action from the weekend, including Kansas' loss to Gonzaga. Now we have a Sweet 16 and some comments from Bill Self that had people talking specifically about how he viewed the last month or so of the season. But you guys have a good weekend? I know the, like, the tournament, it didn't have a ton of upsets. It had enough, you know? It had enough of them. We had some fun moments late.
Like, I would have liked more.
You know, like last night even. Houston, they didn't end up losing. They didn't get upset by the Aggies, but we got a last-second shot to send it overtime. That was perfect for me. Give me all the intrigue, but come Sweet 16 time, come Elite Eight time, give me the top teams.
Nah, I want a mix. I always want a mix. I don't just want the ones and the twos. I want the, you know, we got Cinderella our upsets.
We got Yale won, Oakland won. That was good.
They won one game.
I don't need Yale in the Elite Eight. I'm good.
That's because you're a Kansas fan.
No, that's Kansas is out of the tournament, Cody.
I just want the big boys because the big boys get a play. You just want the big dogs because you don't remember what it's like to root for the little guy.
No, but like, see, the problem with that is literally is Kansas is out of the tournament, so that would be that.
No,
makes
but you support the other big programs.
No, I mean, I was rooting for Boise State the other night. We literally had a bet on that whole thing.
But then you wanted them to lose immediately based on
who to lose. Boise State, yeah. They didn't even win.
No, but I'm saying if they had won, you would have wanted them to lose immediately.
Not them. No,
it does seem like the consensus is more on Gold side of things where. Like St. Peter's made their run to the Elite Eight, and then they got smacked.
That's
absolutely
it, right there.
But they get smacked all the time, even when they're. I hate that. That is my least favorite argument always with this.
That's fine. You don't have to agree with it.
Like really good teams don't get smacked in the college football playoff, or the college basketball tournament. We always pretend like good, like the 3 seed can't get their ass kicked. It's only the 11 seeds.
My
that
thing
get
is, I'm in the middle of you guys.
It's more likely for me, and we're going to talk more about this. But
there's arguments to both sides that. Makes sense.
Yeah, sure. Of course. I mean, that's I would say for most discussions.
For the casual fan, Cody, I'm surprised you're not on Gold side for this, actually, because for the casual basketball fan.
Yeah, normally
fan,
he hates the 7 seed in the NFL playoffs getting in because they suck.
For the casual
I'd
fan,
a lot
or,
of
for the person who
suck.
Or for the person who doesn't watch basketball or all the way up until about March Madness, they watch some March Madness where they really dive in. A lot of times you want to see the best teams face each other because the games tend to be better. You know, you don't want to see the blowouts. If you're a casual fan, more or less, you'd rather see Tennessee play Purdue or whatever.
We'll talk more about this here about 10 minutes or so anyway and what happened. Yes, with Kansas losing to Gonzaga, and then we can talk more in depth about the tournament as a whole. But the news late on Friday night, it was like, what, 9:30, 9:45, Adam Schefter sends out that tweet.
Something
and it's,
like that.
Of course, been confirmed by now. But at the time, it was that L'Jarius Sneed was getting traded or did get traded to the Tennessee Titans. 2025 third rounder, not this
year,
next year's third rounder, and then a pick swap in the 7th round. So the Chiefs do move up in the 7th round. And I'll start here. I was disappointed. I don't know how you can't be. I don't think it was like, oh my gosh, what a terrible trade, but I'm disappointed. Absolutely. I think, you know, we talked about the compensation and clearly the one day of reporting from Diana Rossini that, oh, maybe a team's willing to give up to a first was way off base. And the 2nd round pick clearly was also way off base with some of the reporting because the Chiefs got a 3rd round pick next year. So I was disappointed probably just because of what the conversation was that potentially you could get in compensation. So yeah, I'd be lying if I told you I wasn't disappointed with the return. But the market obviously was not what anybody actually thought for a guy that was very, very good. And it's a reminder that veteran players that are in need of a contract extension in the trade market never get as much as you think.
That was
the reality that happened on Friday night.
No. So you said, I don't know how someone could. I'm not disappointed. Seems fine. Like, I know that sounds like a stretch. You're like, why are you just fine with a future 2025 draft pick, which doesn't seem like that much value, and moving up to the top of the 6th round, or the top of the 7th round, which is practically a 6th, I'm told.
Yeah, when you know it.
It's actually the other way around, typically, the way people talk about it. But it doesn't matter. But so, when you look at the move up, that's fine. The pick swap, that's not insignificant. Moving up 30 spots there, the Chiefs can do a little bit. It's not nothing, but it's not something of substance. It's not or substantial right on that end. The 3rd round pick feels like you still got better value than if you would have just held on to him and prayed for a comp pick. By the way, best case scenario, as in single best case scenario, and honestly, this should be investigated. People think you're just going to get the maximum value of the comp pick. That's not even a guarantee they would have got a 3rd. They might have gotten a fourth.
Because they offset based on your signings.
Yes, yeah. Or a fifth or a million other picks in between. The Titans project to stink, in my opinion. So you are looking at a top half, I think, at worst. Third round draft pick for next year. So that, based on the composition there. The other part, the reason why I'm okay with it, some of it is just like blind belief in Brett Veach because he's earned some blind belief, so okay. But the other part is they told you where they were with Sneed. They didn't want to pay him $19 million. They didn't want to pay him that, and they certainly didn't want to pay him the extension price beyond that. And if they weren't willing to pay him the $19 million and they weren't willing to pay him that, then they got good value back on the trade. Sometimes it's just the way it works.
I just think they got what the value was, right? I mean,
is the value.
Yeah, I mean, that was pretty clear. It's not like they turned down a better offer. They traded him in the conference. They, you know, like all of that. Like there wasn't this. I felt like for a little bit there was this notion on Friday night, because again, I think some people were disappointed, including myself. That, oh my gosh, there was a, you know, that's all they got. Well, that the market, the Chiefs can't force teams to, we always talk about this with trades, specifically with Veach, because people get critical a lot of times with what they do. Sure. With some of these offseason moves, it ends up working out pretty damn well. But you look at what they get, and it's two sides have to agree to terms. That's how this whole thing works. And we forget that. Like, yeah, the Chiefs wanted a second round pick. I'm sure they did. That wasn't a realistic, feasible thing they could pull off. And in their mind, they got the best trade possible. If the Colts were offering a second, they would have traded them to the Colts.
Yeah.
That wasn't an option. And something
the Broncos were. If someone in division was offering a second,
sure,
they would have taken
it. It's a combination of what you said. Everybody knew the Chiefs wanted to really trade them. That hurts you right away. And that, they made it pretty clear. There was the dollar amount that you're going to have to give Sneed, you know, $55 million guaranteed, I believe, is what the Titans reportedly are giving him. And then there's the medical stuff. I mean, let's be real about it. I know he played every game last year and he was awesome. Awesome. He deserves the money he's getting from the Titans. I'm happy for him and all that. But that hurts your compensation when there's a little bit of injury concern for a guy that was on the injury report throughout the entire season. I hope that he plays out that contract and doesn't miss a game and all that for his sake. But that is the concern. And so disappointment, I think, is fair, but that's what the market was. And clearly, we're going to talk more about this in 20 minutes, but what do the Chiefs feel they need to do with that money that they clear? You know, $19.8 million that they now have to have. But if you're asking me, would I have just kept Sneed now knowing the trade value? No, because as we'll talk about soon, I think clearly there is either another move or two, another trade, or just the fact that they've got some contracts they need to take care of long term. And when you draft as well as they have, well, you're going to also have to part ways with some good players. And in this case, that player is L'Jarius Sneed.
I think one of the things that you can look at in this scenario, as far as we're always looking for trends, right? And now that Brett Veach has been around long enough, you can get a sense of the trends that he goes with. He seems fine to bring in an injured player if he wasn't injured for them. But the players who were injured the entire time they were in Kansas City, he seems to be like, nah, we're good.
Yeah. And I think it's also the contract difference.
Sure.
You know, it's one thing to bring in a quote unquote injured player on a 1 year deal, no risk.
Yep.
You know, signing a three, 4 year deal for $55 million guaranteed is a whole different ballgame.
Yeah. And I mean, that's part of it, right? So that, and the price tag involved with it, but I don't even think they wanted to pay the 19. I honestly think this is relatively fair compensation. And like you said, here in about 10 minutes, we can get into what we think they'll do with that $19 million. But part of why I don't mind the compensation is, you can't convince me that they can't use that third-round pick the same way they would have used this third-round pick if you think they're trading up. They can use it the same way. Good. They can use the piece they just got in an identical fashion if the plan all along was to get it. Also, the Titans didn't have a pick in the third round this year. And honestly, we should have known. The second the reporting came out that the Chiefs wanted a second, we should have all known it was never going to be a second. The second that the team is like, that's what we want, and we're all like, well, that's cute. Remember when they wanted a second rounder for Justin Fields or a third rounder for Justin Fields and they got, I don't know, a sixth or whatever the hell it was?
I also think some people, oh, there's a reporter in Tennessee. I don't remember his name. I apologize. But owe that reporter an apology because there was a report, I don't know, 2 weeks ago. And the reporter said, oh, the Chiefs are discussing a third round pick with the Titans. And boy, oh boy, Chiefs Twitter went after the reporter and said, you idiot, you don't even have a third round pick. They were talking about the one in 2025.
He did not specify the year.
He did not. He was correct, by the way.
Which was that guy's name?
I don't know. He was correct, but he got crushed. There was a lot of like Chiefs blogosphere that went after this guy on social media a couple weeks ago, and he was correct. They're like, you idiot. You don't even have a third round pick. There's no way this report is true. Well, he was right. It was a third round pick in 2025. You know what I'm talking about, though, right?
I do, and I kind of want to, like, I want to give that guy his moment, you know?
I don't remember his name, but yeah, he got crushed by a lot of Chiefs fans, and he was correct. People just act like he didn't know what he was talking about. But
that poor guy.
It happens.
Happens. They should apologize.
I said.
Not you.
That's what I said.
The people.
I said, but it, I mean, unfortunately, I said, that's what happens. People, you know, but could you imagine in this perfect scenario, people would actually go back and apologize for calling somebody out about something that they were wrong about? That never happens. You know,
heaven forbid.
You know, that never happens.
Never admit they're wrong
on Twitter.
Oh, you kidding me?
On Twitter? No chance on Twitter. Someone says Brad Stainbrook or something. I think that actually sounds familiar.
That sounds made up. That can't be.
No,
right. I actually think he's right.
I saw it and he thinks that. Yeah, Stainbrook, you don't think that's his actual name?
No.
It might be like an alias.
That is a real person.
Yeah, Stainbrook NFL. There you go. And it's because the reporter wasn't actually in Nashville. It was a Cleveland Browns reporter.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. Yeah. That's what was so confusing
Brad
about it at the
Stainbrook.
Time. Good for you, Brad.
He was right.
Look, and by the way, his announcement that the deal was done was a quote tweet of that original article from March 12th that said, a third round pick has been discussed, sources say. Here's the responses. The Titans don't have a third round pick. From our friend Kent, your source should probably do their homework, was the second response. Stop making S up. They don't have a third round pick, LOL. Check your source, dum-dum. Titans don't have a third round pick. I think I'll trust fake Adam Schefter more than you.
Yeah.
Like, oh my God.
Yeah, they went after
this poor guy.
They went after this guy, and at the time, people weren't thinking, oh, there's a chance, you know, you can trade future picks. So he was correct. And shockingly, Twitter was wrong.
Tweeting yourself when everybody is burying you with the correct
information. It's a sweet moment.
Is a great moment.
Someone just says, cap. Titans don't have a third. Next time, try to be more believable when making up lies. Yeah. Dude, I would be in every single one of those.
Responding back, we're like, hey, what do you think of the trade involving L'Jarius Sneed to that third round pick? I would definitely be petty like that. I would have responded back and be like, yeah, just what did you guys think of that third round pick that the Chiefs got from the Titans? I never said it was a 2024. He never said it was this year's pick.
Just said a third round pick was being discussed.
Uh-huh.
I think that's the most disappointing thing for Chiefs fans is that if it was a third round pick for this year, I think they might be okay with it. It's the fact that it's 2025.
That was probably what made it more disappointing.
That I think ultimately is what it was, because even like you guys discussed it last week, is we're going to learn what the Chiefs' priority is, and we found out they would rather get a third round pick and then the 7 swap than pay L'Jarius Sneed that 19 or whatever million that they would owe, and they trust Spags and the corners who they have.
Because what was it? The Jalen Ramsey a year ago or so roughly got traded, and it was a second round pick and a backup tight end. I mean, it's just veteran players, and unless you are, you know, at quarterback and really wide receiver,
or you're
edge rusher.
To give 2 first rounds for Jamal Adams for no reason.
Yeah, like I mean, yeah, it could be just an inept franchise. That's true. Like quarterback. Wide receiver and edge rusher. Other than that, if you're a veteran that's also due a new contract, like you're probably not getting the great compensation. I know the Chiefs got great compensation back for Tyreek Hill. That's a little bit different. He's a, you know, at this point, a future Hall of Famer, was trending on that track, and it's the wide receiver position, not a corner. I mean, the Chiefs organization internally is also an example of why the value probably isn't great on the trade market. Because the Chiefs have shown that you can go out and acquire via draft and scout via draft, I should say, young talent. And the Chiefs, if they didn't have Trent McDuffie, of course, we're having a completely different conversation. A, they wouldn't have traded him, all this kind of stuff. But you have Trent McDuffie. He's your number one corner. And if he continues on his current path, he's the guy you're going to be paying, I think. We'll see.
Yeah, I would think so.
In 2 years, roughly.
I know we're going to get into it a little bit later, but the NFL has approved 3 new rules at their committee. First rule, to allow a club's ability to challenge a third ruling following one successful challenge.
I like that.
So if you just get one challenge right, you'll get a third.
Fine with me.
They will allow for the enforcement of a major foul by the offense prior to a change of possession in a situation where the fouls are by both teams.
Okay.
And they're eliminating hip drop tackles.
Which, yeah, we, okay. And there's a, I think there's a fourth one. Did you see? It says if the Chiefs are up in a playoff game, they are not allowed to give the ball to their quarterback unless it's the backup for a full quarter. That's what it says. Okay. I think the Bills proposed that one, too. Maybe Cincinnati. Yeah. I'm not sure.
The Bengals don't run away from smoke. The Bills do. That's fine.
In fairness, the Bengals have been suggesting less of these penalties. But, yeah, hip drop tackles are banned.
Was that the meeting that Jerry Jones was at?
Yeah, we'll get. Yeah, he was taking a lot of notes, guys. Important notes about their offseason plans.
A big factor in these changes.
Super important stuff.
So we will talk more about the rule changes and what do you do if you're Brett Veach now that you do have $19.8 million to work with. But back to the NCAA tournament. Obviously, Saturday's action. Saturday afternoon, the 4-5 matchup. Kansas fell to Gonzaga, 89-68. It was a 1-point game at halftime. Kansas gets outscored 46-24. In the second half, their season comes to an end. Gonzaga, another Sweet 16 appearance. They're just consistently always in the Sweet 16 in what was viewed as a down year for Gonzaga, and yet they find themselves there. I mean, I don't know how you guys felt watching the game. None of us going in thought Kansas was winning this game.
We all picked Gonzaga.
All picked Gonzaga to win. Admittedly, at halftime when it was a 1-point game, I was like, huh. I was like, oh. I didn't expect it. Like, I didn't think Kansas was going to be up 1 at halftime. What happened in the second half is kind of, no, I didn't think they're going to lose by 20 plus, but was more what I thought the game was going to be. Their defense was absolutely pathetic. Zag started making every shot. Kansas started forcing shots. They don't have shooters. All the stuff we've talked about throughout the entire season was summed up in that basketball game, plain and simple. Like, I don't care. Kevin McCullough was playing. Doesn't matter. They still would have lost that game. I mean, that was just a pitiful performance, and their season comes to an end, and now automatically you start looking ahead. And the comment that had everybody talking afterwards was Bill Self after the game was asked about this year's season, and he admitted one thing.
For the last month, I've been thinking about next season, to be honest. Not in the moments during the game, but obviously we played. We had 8 guys on scholarship, and we play. I mean, that were healthy there late, and you know, injuries are part of the game, so that's not an excuse, but we could have done a much better job as a staff putting more guys out there that we could play, and so that's something that I've thought about for a long time. And the thing about it is, in basketball, you know, early on you can play through some things, but the course of a season, there's a grind that goes with it, and bodies get run down, injuries occur. That's all part of it. And when you don't have as much firepower or, as you know, that maybe you've had in past years, it certainly showed this year.
So that was Bill Self. How did you take that now that you heard the full minute clip of that? Obviously, the very beginning is what had people talking, where he says that for the last month, he was looking towards next season. That was just the quote that went viral. We just played you the full audio. How did you take it? Because I think he said, first of all, the quiet part out loud, which always gets people all bent out of shape. Because he was being honest, right? I mean, Kansas fans and everybody were already talking about what they need to do in the future right away. Yep. He admitted that they were already looking towards the future and looking towards the transfer portal. And some people, mainly non-KU fans, by the way, actually took more issue with it than KU fans. So I'm just curious where you're at on
it. That's not surprising, because typically you would stand up for your own, which makes sense. And Bill Self's got a good history of taking care of his players.
I would say so.
But though, it sounds like he bailed. Like, the problem with the audio there is that it sounds like he looked at this team a month ago and he's like, well, this ain't going to happen. And I know that, like, and while we might have thought that, because we all definitely did, I just don't think, this isn't one of those, like, as a coach, you shouldn't say it. In the words, you shouldn't think that. Like, you shouldn't just be like, this ain't going to happen, and it's time to start looking to next year's team and moving to the next thing. It just feels too far in advance for a team that at one point this year, and I know that wasn't a month ago, but at one point this year was hanging with the big dogs. It's one of the best programs. Like, couldn't you just convince yourself that with a little bit of health and the right amount of coaching, we can drive this group together to do something more than we think we're capable of right now? Admitting you're already like, let's. And if that's the case, here's the problem. If that's the case, if that's what he genuinely felt, then he should have been playing those young players so much freaking earlier. He should have been getting ahead of this stuff and getting some of the other players more time rather than running out this six-man rotation.
Yeah, but as you just said, though, let's not forget they were a four seed in the tournament, an extremely flawed four seed. They weren't a deep team. Who did you want them? Like, honestly, though, who did you want them playing?
I have to look
like,
back
that's just not
minutes.
That's not realistic, though. A team that was for a while, as you
Why?
Even
just
pointed
said
out,
losing. You just said they gave up.
Oh, okay, now you're just been. Did he say they gave up? Is that what he said?
For the last month, I've been thinking about next season, to be honest. Not in the moments during the game, but, obviously we played, we had eight guys.
Went on from there. I don't think he gave up. I think that's unfair to say. If you want to be critical of the comment, that's very, very fair. I think it was interesting. He probably, should he have said it publicly? No, but this idea of like they threw in the towel and gave up, I think is a mischaracterization of what he said there. There's the snippet of a one sentence that went viral. And if you listen to it, which we all did, the full minute clip, I don't think so. It's one thing when you look at the performance for the team, extremely disappointing. And yeah, they were looking ahead to the future, and I think that's true. But if this team's performance you thought was, hey, the coach wasn't really putting an effort in and wasn't, that would be, and if there were signs of that where the coach had checked out, then I think these comments would be more problematic. But did you think, before you heard that comment, did you think Bill Self had just checked out for the season?
No, I didn't think he had just...
So now he says it, so like, now he's given up on the season?
No,
come on.
But he's focused more, like, and I get it. You'd be like, well, not in the games. Well, that'd be a weird time to be thinking about the future of the next team.
But that's what you made it sound like by throwing just trying in a towel.
No, but
you
like,
said, not me. You
no,
said
but he's
that.
Talking about in every other moment, he's thinking about next year's team. That's what I'm talking about. I'm not saying in any given game against Gonzaga, he's like, well, let's just get this damn thing over with so I can get to next year. I'm saying in all the other time when they're not playing basketball games, the thing he is most concerned about, from the sounds of it, was what next year's team would bring to the table instead of this year's. That's an uncommon thing to think about.
I disagree with that. I think it's an uncommon thing to say out loud. I don't think it's an uncommon thing to think about. You don't think that there's any other coaches
well,
that...
I don't think you can't ever think
you
about
it. You have to look. I mean, that's literally... Yeah. How are you one of the most consistent basketball programs over the last 20 plus years? You always are thinking ahead. I think if we were to get an honest answer from other basketball coaches that had viewed as disappointing seasons by their standards, I bet you there were other coaches that were already thinking, hey, what type of player do I need next year to fill out this rotation? Can I move forward with this guy as my five? Do I need to go and attack this issue? Hey, as a coaching staff, we clearly didn't put together the right mix of guys this year. We didn't put together a good team. We missed and whiffed on the portal with Timberlake, who had one good game in the tournament against Samford, and that was it.
Yeah.
I think that
they
kind of stuff.
They needed him in that game.
Yeah. Well, I think real quick, after hearing the full audio, I think it goes back to him not being able to properly construct the roster that he had those thoughts going into it. Like you, to me, the part that I don't think you admit is not that you're only looking forward to next season, but you're almost admitting in that phrase that the eight guys that you have aren't good enough.
It's like once McCullough got
like,
hurt.
I don't know as a player, if you're at six in that rotation, if you're Furphy, whatever, how do you, I mean, what do you think about that sort of a comment? If you think, okay, I'm part of a team and I know that we have, some of these guys are really good, but we're not good enough. What does that coach think about me if I'm, he's already looking ahead to.
He's always been a bit of a hard on his players guy.
Again, his job is to look ahead to next season, but I feel like he put a little, not pressure, because there's no pressure on Bill Self, but he put some pressure a little bit on him and the staff for next season.
Oh, sure.
Because Dickinson's going to be on. KJ Adams said he doesn't know what he's doing yet. Is that he has to hit the portal. He has to put together a group of guys where they learn this year as well. The Big 12 is so much better than anywhere else that you can't survive with only eight guys because you will be gassed by the time you get to the tournament. Forget injuries. They were going to be tired.
It was an extremely flawed roster. I mean, that was he. I mean, even way before these comments, there were times where he was hinting and mentioning that, like that this. At one point, there were some comments that he said, like never. I think he said, like never again. Basically admitting there were some mistakes made with how they constructed the roster. They took a huge gamble on the Morris kid that had the off the court issues. That was also a bad decision. But they thought that was a player they would have. Like they screwed up. It was not a well put together roster. Plain and simple. The notion though, they're like putting more pressure on them next year. The only thing I'll say about that, Drew, is it's
not
Kansas.
On his,
it's Kansas.
Job.
Like there's Well, I'm not talking job either, whether it's the team, whether it's next year. Obviously, I mean, it's Kansas. Every single year, sure, there's an expectation. That's why there was so much frustration with the team this year that in the Kansas expectation world failed.
That's why Calipari's under heat, because he's done multiple seasons he's underachieved.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, not to say that Bill Self is going to do that, but obviously you can't string together four seed after four seed or five seed and then round of 32 exit.
That's definitely not been the case for Kansas.
Correct.
Yeah,
it has been the case
for Coach K.
All right, coming up next, let's get back into L'Jarius Sneed. Not the trade itself, but what are you doing with all that extra cap space now? Does it mean a big move is on the horizon? That's next.
Cody and Gold, brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
There is a back-to-back Super Bowl champion, and it is the Kansas City Chiefs.
On your official broadcast partner of the Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
Baseball is back, basketball is heating up, and the NFL draft is right around the corner. Listen to latest on the teams you love with the free Odyssey app. The biggest sports radio stations in the country, providing unrivaled local coverage of their teams, all in one place. Exclusive interviews with players, coaches, and team executives, streaming live and always available on demand. Stay in the know with your favorite teams with Odyssey, A-U-D-A-C-Y. Download the free Odyssey app today.
Mitch Holtis here. There's nothing like a game at Arrowhead. For over 50 years, we've shared incredible moments and created unforgettable memories there. Now we've got to keep it going. On April 2nd, vote yes on question one to keep the Chiefs here in Jackson County, with real benefits for every community. New renovations at Arrowhead, and you don't pay any additional taxes. Chiefs Kingdom, this is a golden era of sports, and together we have built a major league city. There's no place like Arrowhead. Let's keep it going.
Intercepted! It's intercepted! Kansas City, you've got a champion!
On April 2nd, vote yes on question one so we can keep the Chiefs in Jackson County.
Paid for by the committee to keep the Chiefs and Royals in Jackson County. Whitney Beaver, Treasurer.
Are you the decision maker in your company? Consider this. For the first time in decades, there's a better option for a corporate card and spend management platform. Meet Ramp, the only corporate card and spend management system designed to help you spend less money so you can make more. Most corporate credit cards offer points as incentives, but those points amount to less than their worth in real cash value. Ramp's corporate cards offer you cash back, real money in your pocket. Plus, you control who spends what with each vendor. And Ramp's software collects and verifies receipts automatically, which means you'll stop wasteful spending and close your books in hours instead of days. Businesses that use Ramp add up to 5% to their bottom line the first year. If you're a decision maker, adding Ramp could be one of the best decisions you've ever made. And now get $250 when you join Ramp. Just go to ramp.com/sports. ramp.com/sports. ramp.com/sports.
Currents issued by Sutton Bank and Celtic Bank, members of FDIC. Terms and conditions apply.
Paid for by government.com. Here's your chance to get five iconic United States silver dollars spanning the last 150 years in one amazing set. Experts agree this is a must-have for silver coin buyers. That's right. All five silver dollars are legal tender official United States Mint coins. If you call 1-800-973-3098 right now, we'll send you this ultimate five-piece American silver dollar set with each silver coin in extremely fine or brilliant uncirculated condition. Guaranteed. This set includes every type of U.S. silver dollar in American history, issued from 1878 to 2024. Call 1-800-973-3098 now to secure your 150 years of U.S. silver dollars five-piece set. Plus, receive a bonus display case, an information booklet, and free shipping. Don't miss your chance. Call 1-800-973-3098 now to secure your five-piece set of iconic U.S. silver dollars before they are gone. That's 1-800-973-3098.
This is a special alert to all Americans Americans who own a vehicle with less than 200,000 miles with an auto warranty about to expire or with no warranty coverage at all. Due to a decline in the economy, CarShield is announcing a low-cost, month-to-month vehicle protection plan that is now available to the public to save any driver out-of-pocket expenses on future auto repairs. Call now to find out how you can pay almost nothing for covered auto repairs. Yes, you heard that correctly. Pay almost nothing for covered auto repairs. An open phone line has been established for all drivers to call for a free quick quote. Call 800-973-7809 now. Drivers who are covered will not have to pay for covered repairs again. This protection plan is at an all-time low. Additionally, drivers who activate this vehicle protection today will also receive free roadside assistance, free towing, and car rental options at no additional cost. Call us for your free quick quote today. 800-973-7809. That's 800-973-7809. What do you have to lose? Call 800-973-7809. Again, 800-973-7809.
Wow, honey, have you seen the electric bill?
Yeah, it's out of control. But have you heard of Navien tankless water heaters?
Tankless? How does that even work?
Well, instead of constantly heating and storing water, it only heats water when we need it. So much more efficient than our giant tank heater.
That sounds great. Let's look into Navien.
Already on it.
Imagine all the hot water you need only when you need it. Bulky tanks are history. Navien high efficiency tankless is the future. Compact, wall-hung units free up floor space, lower energy bills, longer life than tanks, and a 15-year warranty. Find out more at tanklessmadesimple.com.
Purchase new wiper blades from O'Reilly Auto Parts today and we'll install them for free. See better and drive safer with O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
I can't believe tax season is here already. But look at all this info I have to enter.
Phil's small accounting firm is growing in numbers.
Why didn't I take that typing class in high school?
A data entry specialist could really help him in a crunch.
I got blisters on my fingers.
Indeed can help him hire great people fast.
I need Indeed.
Indeed you do. You can schedule and conduct virtual interviews all from your employer dashboard. Visit Indeed.com/credit and get $75 towards your first sponsored job. Terms and conditions apply.
Always find what you love at Total Wine & More. With so many bottles to choose from at the lowest price, it's easy to find your favorite Cabernet or a new single-barrel bourbon to try. With the lowest prices for over 30 years, find what you love and love what you find at Total Wine & More.
Spirits not sold in Virginia and North Carolina. Drink responsibly. B21.
The 610 Sports Radio phone line is brought to you by Onder Law Injury Lawyers. Visit GetJim.com.
Chiefs coverage brought to you by Max Motors. 9 major vehicle brands to choose from. MaxMotors.com.
Going on at all Max Ford locations.
Love it or trade it now.
0% for 72 months on new 2023 Ford F-150s in stock.
Pick your model, choose your color.
In Harrisonville, Manhattan, Richmond, Butler, and Nevada.
Hurry in while selection is best.
With approved credit expires March 31st, 24.
Just getting started here on a Monday. We'll check in on our Cody and Gold Bracket Challenge here in about 8 minutes or so. How all three of us are doing, how some of you are doing. One person in particular has got a very, very impressive bracket to get through the entire weekend already. So we'll check in on that. And just what do we think of the Sweet 16 field and where that stacks up throughout the tournament? That's coming up in just a little bit. But back to the L'Jarius Sneed trade. Now that we know he is not part of this team, you know you get $19.8 million in cap space that was locked up with the franchise tag prior to the trade. So what's the next move? Like, what do you think the plan is now if you were to get inside the mind of Brett Veach a little bit? Because on one hand, I would love to sit here and tell you that I think there's like some other big trade happening now that's going to involve needing all this money. That'd be fun. Sign me up. I'm just, what is that? Who is that? I guess, give me a name who you think that is. Because I don't think that's the move. I think there's another signing or two. Maybe it's a veteran left tackle. Maybe it's another like 1 year deal for another wide receiver further down the board that is still out there.
Which I'm still for.
That is the thought that I kind of have that some of this money is for, unless you believe that they need it for an extension. The reason why I don't think it's just about giving extensions to in-house guys is the way they have typically done contract extension is usually in year one, there's not much of a cap hit anyway. So unless you think they're carrying over, which is not something they typically do either, carrying over money into 2025, like Creed Humphrey's new deal, if he gets a brand new deal to make him the highest paid center in football, which is very likely, I don't think in year one, it's like a $13 million cap hit. That's not typically how they've structured it. If they do,
typically it's like 6.5 or something.
So if they do it that way, it means they're changing their process a little bit. Maybe they are.
Sometimes you got more money in 1 year versus another. Try to spread it around different.
So I think it's more that, A, we know they didn't want to give the long-term extension, but the current money that they wanted to free up, I think a lot of it has to do with maybe some other veteran signings they would like to make before we get to draft day or just the rest of the offseason.
So this is part of the reason, going back to why I like this Sneed deal, is I'm still convinced you could use this year's third round pick or next year's third round pick the same way as you would have used one from this year. As in, if the plan all along was to take the pick from L'Jarius Sneed to move up in either round two or one, you can still do that with a 2025 third round pick, especially the Titans one, which will hold some value. So I like that part of it. For the just pure dollars, some of it's absolutely going to an extension of either Creed Humphrey, Trey Smith, or Nick Bolton. I don't think it's all three, obviously, and I would rank those.
Nick Bolton will be the pricier one.
Yeah, and I would rank those in order of what I think is most likely to happen: Creed, Bolton, then Trey. Mostly just because of the value of center teams typically put on it, even though the Chiefs as a franchise haven't paid those players very often. They're already getting performance escalators, so they already needed a little bit more to pay Creed, to pay Trey, and to pay Bolton based on the level of play they were getting from those players. But I definitely think something's coming. And if I'm going to guess, I think the money is spent on two free agent areas in addition to those. I think they're going to bring in a veteran left tackle to compete with Wanya Morris. I do not think it's going to be the guy who just started no matter what. And I think they're bringing in one more wide receiver, because I think you should. Unless you're just rolling the story back in and you're preying on some development from Sky Moore, Kadarius Toney again, one more veteran wide receiver further down the list just gives you the assurances to make sure you're good. That if one little injury or one guy doesn't perform to the level you're accustomed to, that you have some assurances to protect yourself a little bit. That's where I think the money's going. I could see it maybe going to a guy like Dana, who I mentioned before, but there's just been no smoke around that player at all for the Chiefs or for anyone else in
the league. The longer it takes, the market you would think is going to continue to dip, and all of a sudden you get a 6.5 sack guy on a, maybe a cheaper deal. So I think, yeah, the money that they freed up, it's most likely going to be some other, you know, one-year type of contracts that they would like to hand out. Some guys that are going to, you know, be making maybe in year one with incentives $8 million or $10 million a year, and so you needed to save that. Whether it's a Donovan Smith type at left tackle again, even though I would prefer them to spend it in the draft, use their draft capital for that position. But yeah, wide receiver wise, is Drew's guy still out there? Is Josh Reynolds still available? I mean, someone like
Boyd.
Tyler Boyd, a Michael Gallup, like those type
there's
of guys,
decent wide receivers still
that aren't going to break the bank. But you needed 19.8 to free up, and so that's what is fun now. Is okay, you made the big trade to send Sneed away. What do you got up your sleeve, Brett Veach? You know there's something. There's obviously a reason to his moves that he made. And so we'll see. I mean, some other names that, like, DJ Chark, I think, is still out there too, right?
It's a lot of good available wide receivers. I think some of the money has to be going there. What's funny is none of us mentioned corner. Not a single one of us said that some of where the money's going is free agent corner. We're all like, nah. It'll be Williams and Watson.
And McDuffie, there's three corners right there.
Well,
you
back built.
Well, yeah. So you got McDuffie. You have obviously the three we mentioned. And then you go ahead and you can take a look at the draft where they've had all this success.
And they might like Nazi Johnson or Nick Jones and some of these other secondary pieces they've kept around or seem like they were making some progress to be kept around. I assume that's one of the four or five guys. And then, yeah, I assume now they'll probably spend one of their first three picks on corner.
I don't think it's going to be their first round pick,
but I wouldn't be surprised
I think that
if it's
or offense or third and or offensive fourth. Line. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it could be later. It could be later than draft. I mean, they've had a really good track record. Now, I don't claim to know how deep the cornerback draft class is. We can talk to Bink about that when we have him on next. And Chris and Bink do a great job with the Character Concerns podcast. I don't know if this is viewed as a really deep corner draft where you can find
There's a couple
talent,
guys who are very good, but
not further back. But look, when the Chiefs drafted L'Jarius Sneed, let's be real. Nobody here was sitting, oh my gosh, it's going to be a guy that's a starter, and one day he's going to be getting a $55 million guaranteed contract. You don't think that when you get drafted in the fifth round. That's a credit to Sneed, obviously. It's also a credit to the Chiefs development and scouting department. Yeah. And I do have faith that at that particular position, they do have a really strong track record. We can be skeptical about other areas, you know, wide receiver or edge over the years, even though they've done better at both here the last couple. Corner's an area where, since even day one, Brett Veach and his staff have had a very nice track record at evaluating, scouting the cornerback position.
The one thing I think is, like, about, you know, when you're coming back around to making those decisions on it, it's like, if people are always worried about, like, the Spags blitzing thing, they've just used different guys there for the last 4 years in a row. So that is, like, the least of my concern. They used Sneed more 2 years ago, McDuffie more this year. It was Matthew in the years before. Like, they've just moved different guys around to be the blitzing guy. So I guess that part of it doesn't concern me. I worry about the physicality on defense. This is one of the few times where I felt like they were strong in that regard. But, you know, that's just one of the trade-offs. I don't think the money's going to a free agent corner. Maybe I'm wrong, but I felt like they must have felt really good about that room to trade Sneed in the first place. If they didn't like their room outside of that, I don't think they'd have traded him for a 2025 third.
I think that's probably fair to say.
At least seems like a safe bet.
All right, I was pulling it up because someone on the text line had mentioned as well, as they heard us, we were going to talk about the brackets a little bit, just our Cody Gold bracket challenge. And someone texted and Eric said, I'm second in the bracket challenge. I'm not going to win.
But you're second.
So wondered if I could get a consolation prize. Take care. Look, let's run through it real quick just for listeners that are in our Cody and Gold bracket challenge. First place currently, Manuel G is, or Manuel maybe, I'm sorry, but is in first place with 37 picks correct, and he's got 151 points possible. Right behind him, though, is someone, Alex S., who that's who is texting in, I believe, right?
No. Eric, who is
tied for second.
He's tied for second. He's further down the list.
Yeah, he's only got 150 possible points. The guy that's in the top of second is 178. So those are the guys at the top of the board. And if you're wondering, Houston and UConn are a lot of the picks there at the top. And at the very bottom, we always mention who is currently in last place. Sorry, that's part of the game. Ricky S.
Ricky S. Look, I don't think you're going to finish last.
No, he's got 133. I'll tell you who's going to finish last.
It's one of two people.
Either Gideon B, who had Kentucky winning it all, who only has 69 points possible and only has 20 employee. And only has 26, or yeah, Joe Summers, I'll
just say
his
name.
He picked
he
Auburn.
He doesn't get the anonymity clause.
He picked Auburn to win it all. He's got 67 points possible and he picked 28. So that's where the listeners stand, and it could change again. How are all three of us doing though?
I'm technically ahead of both of you, but I'm screwed.
Okay, tell us where you're at.
Okay, so as it sits right now, I'm in 19th.
Okay.
A respectable number, 19th.
Very respectable.
Lost my national champion in Baylor. Mm. That's probably not going to help me. Three of the other four of my final four are still left, so I've got like 115 max points, but I can't
That's the issue.
I can't get that big point total because my national champion is gone. Otherwise, I'd be in really nice shape.
You picked a lot of games correctly.
Yeah.
That's how you're in 19th. The max point thing is where it's hard for you to get more points now.
I mean, other than getting three of my other four Final Four teams, but again, most people have those teams, so it doesn't really help me.
I'm in a nice 69th currently. I lost my runner-up. We all know that with Kentucky against Oklahoma. Yep. That right away. I was back to like 170 for a little bit over the weekend.
Yeah, it was pretty bleak there for a bit.
I do have three of the four remaining, and my national champ is UConn, who looks great so far.
You have no chance of winning, but you can finish very respectably.
140 max points. So that's where we sit right now. And then Drew,
I'm sitting in the back of the pack.
You're
guys.
In the back of the on three of us here, but
I'm in better shape.
You've got
going
nine
forward.
More max points than me, and you got what 30 plus more possibility than Cody. You've got both teams.
I have UConn and Tennessee still in, and then the only team I have out of the Final Four is Baylor. The problem that I had,
Baylor too.
Where I got screwed was Baylor in the Final Four, and I had Grand Canyon going to the Elite Eight to play Baylor. So
ooh, you had a shot there for a minute.
That region
got sweaty.
That region was not as crazy as I thought it would be. Obviously, I told you
all the ones and twos advanced, so the draft itself was not as crazy.
So that's our bracket challenge. Bracket but what do you make of the Sweet 16? I mean, as you said it right there. So on Thursday, we're going to see one seed UConn. And one seed North Carolina. UConn's going to take on San Diego State. UNC's taking on Bama. Then you got two seeds playing on Thursday. It's two seed Iowa State against three seed Illinois, which should be a great game. That's probably the one on Thursday I'm most looking forward to. And then Arizona taking on what has been a surprise Clemson team, six seed, one of the more surprising teams. Then Friday, you have the two number ones still in action, Purdue against Gonzaga, Houston against Duke. And then the highest remaining seed, NC State. They keep staying hot.
Didn't have them anywhere near.
They're taking on two-seed Marquette and then Creighton and Tennessee, which might be the best game of the entire Sweet 16. Two-seed Tennessee against three-seed Creighton.
It's like, based on play, UConn looks like the heavy favorite.
Yeah,
they have steamrolled through the first two rounds. But also,
Purdue looks pretty damn good, too.
Yeah, no, they do.
I know the history there, but Purdue,
they absolutely do. My guess is that NC State has a real chance to continue their Cinderella story because Marquette is a good team. There's no doubt. But Colorado really challenged them. I mean, that game, Colorado got hot in the second half and made a good challenger out of that game. I don't think that that thing's a walk away. The only ones where I'm like, where I feel confident about the team I think is going to the Elite Eight is UConn over San Diego State. That might be the only game where I'm like,
rematch last year's national title.
Yeah, that's the only one where I feel very confident about it. Because all of a sudden, as much as I assume Purdue will beat Gonzaga if I had to pick it, Gonzaga looks a lot saltier than we were giving them credit for. When Kansas and Gonzaga came into the tournament, people were feeling similar about those two teams, as in, lower seeded than they normally are because no one really can't get a feel for them. They've underperformed a good chunk of the season, but they've turned it on and have looked a lot better. I still think as much as I thought this was open, I don't know, man. It just feels like there were eight good teams this year. Maybe everybody else was just mediocre.
Yeah, look,
you know?
I know we disagreed on it, but like I think it's been a great tournament. We got a couple of upsets. We also just had some fun finishes, even though Houston still hung on last night. The Aggies coming back and hitting the last second shot to send to overtime. Like those are the moments that I'm looking for. And then as we get closer to Phoenix for the Final Four, I personally am happy I see four number one seeds still around entering the Sweet 16. I do, like, I'm excited for when we get Houston against Duke. That to me is, it means we're probably in for a really good basketball game. That's we like the fun stories, no doubt. I've always just been, I like the fun stories the first couple days of the tournament. And then later on in the tournament, like, UConn's been the best team the entire season. I want UConn to get close to the Final Four of the Final Four. Like, Purdue, one of the better teams all year. Like, I think watching Zach Edey play is a lot of fun to watch. So
you
that's
like
where
to
I'm
see the Blue Bloods.
It's not even the, I mean, the I, elite that, Purdue's teams, not even, yeah, I'd say Purdue's not a Blue Blood, but I.
The only Blue Blood in there is, well, Duke and North Carolina, I guess.
I think Gonzaga's a Blue Blood.
Yeah,
they just haven't won.
This is a fun. We don't have to get into this.
But, well, so the most
in 10 years, 15 years, probably. I feel like Blue Blood's got to do it for like 50. Almost. Yeah, UConn.
Everybody's got a different like definition within it. Like, if UConn goes back to back, I don't know how. I mean, if you look at the last 20 years, what they've been able to do.
I consider them a Blue Blood. Yeah, I would consider them.
Go ahead. Sorry.
Well, I was going to say the most impressive teams to me so far, UConn, Illinois have looked very good. That game against Iowa State is going to be a lot of fun because Illinois score a ton of points. Iowa State, obviously, one of the best defensive teams in the country.
Alabama's playing North Carolina, and I don't want to overreact to one game. That Alabama game was so ugly last night. I mean, it was pathetic.
Fouls everywhere. Yeah.
Fouls ugly.
No
everywhere.
One could dribble.
It was terrible. UNC is still the most vulnerable of the ones, though. I mean, if we're like, we're basing, I know Houston went to overtime with A&M. Like, I'm not.
But they had control of that game and let them back in.
Yeah, like North Carolina, Alabama, that's a sneaky one. I haven't even looked at the spread, I swear, on that game. But Alabama's a team that I might be considering to back for an upset against North Carolina.
I think Gonzaga can give Purdue problems because of the way that they play. Purdue struggling against teams that move up and down the floor quickly. Gonzaga do that. They don't have as much size because, you know, Timmy's not there anymore. Mm-hmm. But they can. Not necessarily wear Zach Edey out, but yeah, Mark Few is as good as it gets. I think.
Great point on Gonzaga, by the way, over on Twitch. They've never won a national championship. You can't be a blue blood and have zero titles.
Yes, you can be.
No way. UConn's got a handful of them.
I disagree. Yeah.
As a program, you got to have a national title be a blue blood.
Yeah, like Gonzaga over the last 20 years has been one of the best basketball programs. Nobody should debate that. I mean, they consistently go to Sweet 16s. They've been a great. You have to have won a national championship to be a blue blood. I fully agree with that, and you can say that's my KU bias, but like Cody's even agreeing with me on this one, which is shocking.
You don't have a title.
I agree.
The overall consensus in the college basketball media community is Gonzaga is a blue blood.
No. Is that the overwhelming consensus?
They are a blue blood.
They're always consistently one of the better programs every year, and
they've won more NCAA tournament games than all but like one program in the last 15 years.
It sounds stupid. It sounds stupid, but this is the same argument we've given like in the NFL, right? For years and years and years, we agreed Andy Reid was one of the best head coaches, right? For years, going back to Philly. Yeah. But until he won one, nobody actually considered him a chance to go down as one of the greatest coaches of all time.
You don't have to be.
But that's how we do it.
There's five blue bloods in college basketball. There's not one.
I agree.
Andy Reid has always been a blue blood elite head coach.
People did not,
but look at the teams who are considered.
He's always been that. Yes, it's easy to say now.
He never could be
the best. That was the big knock until he won a ring. It changed. And the same thing will be said. If Gonzaga wins a ring and they're having this, then all of a sudden they're. I disagree, man. Someone says, do you think Cincinnati's a dynasty? Because they haven't won one, but they're going to AFC title games on a regular basis.
Like the teams that are considered
one dynasty.
The teams that are considered blue bloods, here they rank in national titles. UCLA used to be in that mix. Aren't really discussed as a blue blood
they're
anymore.
Not.
They have 11
Indiana
titles.
Is not. At least UCLA recently won something. But
Kentucky has the second most titles ever, 8. North Carolina has the third most titles ever, 6.
Yes.
UConn has they're tied for the fourth most, 5.
Yes.
Duke, 5. Yep. Indiana off the Kansas, 7. Yes. Villanova, 3. Like, There's no way the teams that everyone Zags considers a blue blood
they're a great
are the top
program.
Five all-time titles.
They've been one of the top 5 to 7 college basketball programs of the last 15 plus years. Not debating that. I think that's exactly where they're at. Yeah. But you gotta win a national championship. And I know the tournament is a crapshoot at times, and it's extremely tough. Gonzaga has been there though, and
that's
had a chance to
that's
win
why
one.
Blue blood's blue blood, you know. Right. They right. managed to get through the tournament more than other people.
But Gonzaga, it's not even just because where they're at and the smaller school. No, it's just like you do have to win a championship to put yourself in that category, in my opinion. And I think I would disagree. Like that's obviously your point, and that's fine. Like, I would disagree with you though, mainly on the notion that like I don't think you have the majority opinion on that.
No, I think I do actually.
From regular fandom, no, but like from people who cover college basketball, Jeff Goodman, Andy Katz, Seth Greenberg. Gonzaga
Seth Greenberg thinks Virginia Tech got screwed every year they didn't make the tournament when
Gonzaga
he was the head coach.
Gonzaga is a blue blood. Jay Billis, Gonzaga's a blue.
Jay Billis wanted to arrest kids for court storming.
Wait, has Jay Billis said that?
You didn't hear that?
No, the blue blood. Not the arresting. I heard that. I crushed that stupid take. The Gonzaga thing. Has he said that? Or are you just presuming he would?
Because
I'll text him, and we can text him. We have Jay Billis' phone number.
Text him, is Gonzaga blue blood?
Because I don't think Jay Billis would agree. Like, that specific example, so. I don't think Jay Billis would agree.
I think he would.
So I'll be honest with you. I'm going to text Jay Billis right now. I don't know if he'll respond, but I'm going to text Jay Billis right now from my phone.
Don't even say who you are. Just
And I'm going to provide no other information other than, is Gonzaga a blue blood? And let's see if he gets back
You're
to
correct
us.
On Andy Katz. Andy Katz says, Gonzaga takes on anyone. Like it or not, the Zags are a blue blood. So that's a quote from Katz. I firmly disagree, but that is a quote from Andy Katz.
If you are an annual title contender for 10-plus years in recent memory, you are a blue blood. Indiana hasn't been in a title contention since 1990.
No, I don't think they're
like that argument.
Villanova has a better
Baylor's
argument.
Baylor's a blue blood.
No.
They've been in the Final Four a couple of times. They didn't have a title.
Baylor's not a blue blood because they haven't done it as long as Gonzaga has. They're close.
You said 10 years. You just told me 10 years.
Yes, but they haven't. They've been knocked out of the tournament in the first round 2 or 3 times. Yeah. Gonzaga's never had that happen to them.
I just don't know. I think when we're talking about the elite of the elite, as in blue blood, how not winning a championship you can be in that. Like, nobody's saying Gonzaga's not a great program.
So
Mark Few is a Hall of Fame head coach. Great program. But you cannot be in the select 3, 4, 5 if you don't have a championship at all.
So then Kentucky's not a blue blood then?
No. Calipari won one in the last
in
he won
2010.
That's still and has Gonzaga won one since 2012 or 2010?
No, they've won
in 2012,
no.
I think.
Have
by
they
the
won
way.
Any since 1750? And the answer is still zero. Doesn't matter.
True,
how far
true.
Back
Kentucky
go.
Won in 2012, and while that's over 10 years now, I'm with you. That's a long time, but if you could tell me Gonzaga had won one in like 2011, then we're having a different. They haven't won one in 50 years. Like, you know what I mean?
So
like,
is Villanova a blue blood?
I think so.
I don't think so.
Yeah, they're much. I don't they have they a stronger case than Gonzaga.
No, they don't. They didn't make the tournament this year. They're not a blue blood.
Right after they advanced,
Wisconsin,
this is what he said,
has a national title, and they've made it to 2 national title games and 2 Final Fours in the last decade. They're not. Wisconsin is not a blue blood,
agreed.
But they have a national title.
I agree. Wisconsin's not a blue blood. No, nobody makes that case.
No one's. While we're waiting for Jay Billis to respond to us, I saw his tweet from right after Gonzaga won. I want to note the lack of mention of the word blue blood.
Okay.
Jay Billis says Gonzaga. 9 consecutive Sweet 16 appearances.
Great
Go
program.
Ahead. Try to rationalize or marginalize that. You can't. No other program can match it today, and precious few in history can. Either amazing. He doesn't say anything about blue blood. He just says, what an accomplishment.
Nobody's disputing. Mark Few has done one of the best coaching jobs of the last 25 years, maybe in one of the best in college basketball history.
I don't think we're planning on getting a Gonzaga blue blood argument today.
No.
I'm telling you, the consensus is that they are a blue blood.
Consensus.
From people who cover the sport, they are a blue blood.
I can't believe on this show we're going to have to do a poll of national college basketball people and find out.
Someone wants to know, since if you're going to use the Villanova didn't make the tournament argument this year, do you think, you know, if you're talking about North Carolina a year ago, they didn't make
the
tournament.
Technically,
are they not?
Due to penalties, Kansas didn't make the tournament a couple years ago.
That's true. It did happen.
According to the NCAA, Kansas didn't make the tournament, right?
Yes, they won a title in 2022, but I hear you. Like North Carolina didn't make the tournament last year, so they're out. You can't miss tournaments and be one.
Well, how recently did Villanova win a national title?
I don't have that the exact front of me.
3 years ago?
With no. The reason why I have with you the how recently did they win a title argument, like, no offense, like, that's the argument you can't use because Gonzaga doesn't
has
have
zero.
One. Like, if Gonzaga had one, then I think it's a completely different story.
But based on your argument.
No, because
North
Carolina
won it in 2018, 5 years ago.
North Carolina's been one of the best basketball programs with multiple titles over the last 20 years.
Based on your argument, Wisconsin has a national title, and they've been to multiple Sweet 16s, multiple Elite Eights, a national title game, and a Final Four. In the last decade, are they a blue blood? No. Wisconsin have a national championship. So they're valid according to that argument. And they have been very good in the Elite Eight, the Sweet 16, the Final Four, and the title game. They've been in more title games than a lot of than Wait, Kentucky has been.
Wisconsin hasn't won a national championship
in 10 years.
There were tourney running up in 2015. When's the last time Wisconsin drew won a national championship?
A very, very long time ago.
1941.
But again, they've won a national title. So based on your argument of you have to win a title.
No, because we said Indiana's not even a blue blood anymore. Because you know why? They're out.
UCLA.
Because they haven't won since the
90s.
But they haven't been consistently in the tournament at all like a school like Wisconsin has. That's what I'm telling you.
You have to have at least one national championship.
You're trying to separate the two things. Indiana has sucked the last 30 years, but they have a national title.
And nobody on this show is saying they're a blue blood
Wisconsin
anymore.
Has been very good the last decade and has a national title, but they're still not even in the conversation.
You got to stop referencing a title though from 80 years ago, man. Like, we got to stop with like that. Just, that's not part of the argument. Like that again. If Gonzaga had won,
if Indiana's in consideration for.
I don't think they're.
You're considering them more than you would Wisconsin or UCLA.
Yeah, because Indiana's got like five of them or six of them, I think.
Wisconsin is more of a blue blood than Indiana is right now.
Based
on what you guys are saying, Wisconsin is more.
I don't think
Wisconsin's a blue blood, and I don't think they are even close to a blue blood. But based on what you guys are saying, are in the blue blood conversation.
Yeah. But if we want to really peel back the onion and just keep adding more layers to it. Then we haven't even discounted Gonzaga on the one biggest knock on them ever during this run, which is what? They're in a crappy-ass conference. I agree, but if we're going to pull that card, what I'm saying is, like, we can go further into it. We can do it later in the show. We spend way too much time on
I think
Gonzaga.
San Francisco is a blue blood. Yeah. They have two titles. Villanova, that's twice as much as Wisconsin.
And Villanova's won two in the last, like, 8 years, so that's why they're in that conversation.
Yes. One of the best programs.
All right, coming up next, so let's talk some baseball. Opening day is this week. Opening day is this week, coming up on Thursday at a Kauffman Stadium. Besides Bobby Wood Jr., the next most important player, and penalties and changes in the NFL, and I'm worried that it's going to be a major problem early in this season.
Cody and Gold, brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
There is a back-to-back Super Bowl champion, and it is the Kansas City Chiefs.
On your official broadcast partner of the Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
It's time to play ball, KC. Join Cody and Gold at the Rally House on East 39th Street in Independence this Wednesday from 10 to 2 to gear up for Royals season with all the latest and most popular Royals gear. Plus, enter to win awesome Rally House prizes. See you there.
Storms just came rolling through Kansas City. Hail hit so much of the metro. You want to make sure you work with a roofing company you can trust, and that is Century Roofing. You can go to CenturyRoofingKC.com and make sure that you can rely on them, their trustworthy inspection, and don't just trust some overnight flyby roofing company that comes knocking at your door trying to work through it. They will work with your insurance company, make sure that all the points are needed, and because of that sizable hail that hit Missouri, you can make sure if you were on that east side where it was really bad, right, Independence, Blue Springs, Greenwood, you're really covered, or even I'm in the Northland where it got me as well. Make sure you work with a roofing company that's been working in the local area for 33 years and a warranty they'll stand behind because you know that they're going to be around to honor it, not someone who just tries to knock on your door and figure it out. Look, right now they're offering a free impact-resistant upgrades on all roof replacement jobs, and you can figure out which damage exists and work with those insurance companies. Work with a company voted best roofing company in Johnson County for the last 2 years in a row. Schedule your estimate today from KC-based and female-owned Century Roofing. Trust the pillars of strength, CenturyRoofingKC.com, and tell them that Cody sent you.
Hey guys, B-Dub here from Fesco in the Morning. You've been waiting to start your weight loss program. It's time to embrace the revitalizing energy of the season and jumpstart your weight loss journey. Time to get the dad bod in shape. Slim for Life wants to help. This is the last week featuring their lowest prices of the year during their friends and family sale. This is how I'm losing the weight. I hooked up with my girl Leanne at the 119th and Metcalf location. Her and her crew put together a program for me, and it is working to perfection. I've now lost the equivalent of 4 truck tires in just 8 months. You can be down 20 pounds or more in your first month. Seize this perfect opportunity to begin with a free consultation. Let them know that you heard it from B-Dub, and you can take advantage of the friends and family sale, the lowest pricing of the year, for one more week. It all starts with that consultation. Make the life-changing call like I did. 833-SLIM today. That's the number you need to call. 833-754-6863. Or you can hit them online at slim4life.com. All services included, exclusive of products. What are you waiting for? Make the call. Tell them B-Dub sent you.
The most common form of treatment for the arthritic joints is normally cortisone injections and gel shots and over-the-counter medications. And most patients have tried all of that and are still in pain.
Every day, Dr. Aaron Wolkoff, a QC Kinetics medical director, meets patients who have exhausted every method to get relief. They've been told surgery is their only option.
They want to stay away from that path, and they come to us almost as the last hope. So we're using our own body's properties to help manage pain, to help slow arthritis down, keep the patients active with no downtime, and getting back to what they enjoy doing. I mean, I love what I do.
QC Kinetics regenerative treatments from our board-certified providers help heal and restore aching joints. No surgery, harmful drugs, or downtime. Call for your free consultation today.
Call QC Kinetics, 816-412-6299. That's 816-412-6299. 816-412-6299.
Say goodbye to busted brackets because FanDuel lets you bet on every single game of the tournament. So whether you're betting on the big upset or you're picking the one seed to advance, it's time to go dancing on America's number one sportsbook app. Right now, new customers get $200 in bonus bets if your first $5 bet wins. There's nothing more exciting than having some stakes and some wagers on the tournament. So again, whether you're picking that thrilling upset or you feel like you're going to have the perfect bracket, the best place to showcase that is my friends at FanDuel. They're giving you $200 to use on point spreads, money lines, player props. You can even pick who you think's going to cut down the nets. So visit FanDuel.com, use my promo code CDOT, and you can bet college basketball for a fun and exciting March. 21 and present in Kansas. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued in non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. FanDuel is offering sports wagering in Kansas under agreement. Kansas Star Casino, LLC. Gambling problem? Getting help is your best bet. Call 1-800-522-4700. Visit KSGamblingHelp.com.
Let's save lives. An introduction to suicide prevention is an education program designed by and for the Black community. To learn more, go to afsp.org/chapters. AFSP is an I'm Listening partner. Learn more at imlistening.org and on the Odyssey app.
If you're looking for the most epic place on earth, let's start at the base of a massive waterfall. Then trek through the thick jungle. Then climb to the peak of a snowy mountaintop. Then once you get there, keep going. Because with intelligent 4x4 and 7 drive modes and a Nissan Pathfinder, the search is the real adventure.
Available feature. Intelligent 4x4 cannot prevent collisions or provide enhanced traction in all conditions. Always monitor traffic and weather conditions.
This March, Wendy's is fueling the madness with amazing deals on their hamburgers made with fresh, never frozen beef.
Like a juicy Dave's single for $1 and a fresh $2 Dave's double with in-app offer.
It's such a good deal, we wrote a little ditty about it.
Get it for $1. Dave's single, order in the app. Dave single, get it for $1. Choose wisely, choose Wendy's official hamburger March Madness.
Limited time offer, participating U.S. Wendy's. See offer details and redeem at Wendy's app. Account registration required. Fresh beef available in the contiguous U.S. and Alaska.
This March, Wendy's has some amazing deals on their hamburgers made with fresh, never frozen beef.
Like a juicy Dave's single for $1 and a fresh $2 Dave's double with in-app offer.
It's such a good deal, we wrote a little ditty about it.
Get it for $1. Dave single, order in the app. Dave single, get it for $1. Choose wisely, choose Wendy's official hamburger March Madness.
Limited time offer, participating U.S. Wendy's. See offer details and redeem at Wendy's app. Account registration required. Fresh beef available in the contiguous U.S. and Alaska.
eBay Motors is here for the ride. Go ahead, feel your engine. Admire that perfectly installed exhaust. Your vehicle's moving along this freeway like it was made from fresh installs and a whole lot of love. With eBay Motors, you get over 122 million parts to keep it running. And with eBay Guaranteed Fit, they'll be the perfect fit every time. Plus, at these prices, well, we're burning rubber, not cash. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions apply.
You're listening to 610 Sports Radio from the Mission Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling Studios.
Hey, it's Creed Humphrey, and you're listening to the official broadcast partner of the Super Bowl champion Kansas City Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
KCSB Kansas City, WDAF HD2 Liberty, always live on the free Odyssey app.
O'clock hour here on Cody and Gold. We'll get to opening day in a second, but there continues to be a lot of news coming out of the NFL league meetings around rule changes. We'll get to the hip drop tackle conversation again in just a second, but you were pointing out something Tom Pelissero just tweeted out, which is going to be really interesting on reviewing certain calls now in the NFL.
Well, we were just talking about this college basketball and the missed block call, right? In the Kansas game there at the end versus Samford, but Tom Pelissero said the NFL Competition Committee Chair Rich McKay said the replay assistant is now permitted to correct certain types of incorrect calls for roughing the passer and intentional grounding. Must be purely objective. QB wasn't hit in the head, was out of the pocket, etc. But think back to like when Chris Jones hit Tom Brady on the shoulder pad. In this hypothetical, the replay assistant would be allowed to be like, whoa, 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 wasn't roughing.
Okay, so the key part there is if you just disagree, like, oh, he barely touched him, that's not reviewable. It's whether or not they truly fundamentally...
Or they were out of the pocket. It's supposed to be like, this is a no-doubter. So how often will they change it? I don't know.
Yeah, probably not that much, because I feel like sometimes the roughing the passer where people get frustrated is like, they're just like, oh, well, he barely touched him. That's not going to be reviewable. No. But if it was just fundamentally they screwed up, like, no, he
they
was
call the
out
face
of the
mask,
pocket.
But he didn't touch his face mask, you know? Okay. Gotcha. Like, think about it like a roughing where you hit him in the head, which is roughing, but you didn't. You hit him in the shoulder. Okay, that gets overturned.
And again, it's just for roughing the passer and intentional grounding.
Thank goodness we didn't get back into the pass interference thing.
Yeah, so
it says types of incorrect calls for roughing the passer and intentional grounding.
Yeah, so it's really only for roughing the passer and intentional grounding. Go ahead, Drew. Sorry.
Well, I was going to say, when they reviewed pass interference, like none of them got overturned. So I'm glad we're not going back down that.
That was a whole thing where the officials didn't want to overturn their buddy, basically, is what happened with that whole thing. And so nothing changed. This is just like, hey, you flat out missed something very specific, but not the. Yeah. Not the stuff of like we just as fans watching are like, oh, he barely really touched that guy. Those are still happening. And also Rich McKay mentioned that they have not taken a vote yet on the kickoff change. That's why we haven't seen anything. Sure. It doesn't mean it didn't fail. It failed. They just haven't done the vote on that. But the hip drop tackle, that's the story of the day in the NFL, which is a subjective call. I think it's going to be very difficult for them to actually call properly. And I'm worried that this is going to be the story of the first month of the season until either teams adapt, players adapt, or the officials cut back on it. The only part that could prevent this is in the same memo, the league says that initially they expect most of these calls to end up being post-game calls that make like fines. And
they
not,
claim that, yes.
They claim, yeah. Not in-game a ton of 15-yard penalties, because that's where it becomes a massive issue. I know the player hates getting the fine. Yeah. I'm sure they're not happy. But from a fan watching the game, if we're to believe what they're saying, the NFL believes that these will not result in a bunch of 15-yard penalties, that you'll get a letter in the, you know, at your locker the next day.
And then if you do it again, you will get a penalty in-game, which could have a massive impact. Look, I watched the tape, and other than the fact that it seems to contain an awful lot of Justin Reed.
they're using him as the example.
They only use like four players as an example, and they show like five different angles of a Justin Reed tackle.
Well, hopefully they work with him on that then.
In the video. So other than the fact it contains a lot of Justin Reed, and some people have correctly pointed out that the International Rugby Association has also banned this and has managed to successfully do so due to the injury stuff. Dude, I'm looking at the replay of the plays you're showing. Those just look like tackles. Yep. How the hell are they supposed to officiate this? And I understand. So if anyone wants to know, hey, what is a hip drop tackle? It is when you grasp them in a way and then drop rather than try to drive their body weight down, you drop your weight, usually typically on the back towards their legs, in order to bring their weight down. if you watch the little, Tom Pelissero's got a little video out on it, you can get kind of a sense of what it looks like. I don't know how an NFL, I don't know how they're going to officiate it, man. I'm a little worried that if we get even one or two penalty calls a game, we're going to be stuck in this no man's land. We think we don't like knowing what a catch is. I'm sure as hell not going to be sure if he hip drop tackled him or not.
Yeah, that's why I'm worried that, it becomes the story the first couple weeks, unless they are going to do what they're saying, which is initially, you're right, it is too tough to tell on the fly, and so it's going to be a post-game thing where someone's going to go back and look.
15 fines a week.
And you're going to have a ton of fines until players adjust. That's that I think fans will be okay with. It sucks for the player, but fans would be okay with. But if all of a sudden in the first quarter they throw a flag on this hip drop tackle, but in the fourth quarter we're like, hey, that's a hip drop tackle, and they don't call it, that's where you're going to start getting into a huge issue. It'll just join the club with all these other calls that are so subjective and tough. And this is where I'll defend officials on the field a little bit. Like, this
that's
is
a tough job already.
Yeah, it's a tough job already, and now you're adding a call that's going to be really tough on the fly for these officials. Like, this is where I don't envy, you know, the officials that we make fun of sometimes and have plenty of criticism towards. Like, that's a really tough thing you're asking them to do now.
It's in a sport, it is very hard, especially football, to be like, just don't do that one thing. It's a very thing, because like, different coaches are going to enforce it differently. Just when you talk about, like, there's every year there's rankings of most likely to call a pass interference penalty. So there's going to be some crew that does nothing but call these hip drop things. And God, is that the thing I want? Like, if you just find them all season long and it was never a single penalty, whatever. You're trying to still teach them a lesson through the pocketbook, I guess, of what it is. But this idea of equal enforcement on this is a total nightmare. And they already have situations. And when refs are deciding important games, do you want it to come down to this?
Yeah, I'm hoping this ends up being something that we, you know, everybody freaks out for no reason. And it doesn't, you know, there's been other rule changes that have happened in the past. And we think it's going to be a huge deal, and including myself. And it ends up not after a week. And I'm hoping that that's what this is going to be, where everybody gets bent out of shape for no reason. And then we're like, you know what? All right. No problem. And the players are upset, though, because they get fines and then maybe they have to adjust. But from a watching the game, I'm hoping, because the NFL has done this before where there's an initiative like this. And for the first 2 weeks, it becomes like the story. And then magically, it kind of just stopped going good a little bit. I could see that happening as well. So we'll see. But, man, you're just asking the players and the refs, both parties, to do their job in an even more challenging way than what it already is. And it's also a sign where I just think you're getting closer and closer to, man, are we just going to start not allowing these guys to tackle players 10 years? Like, I am worried about, like, I know not to, sometimes I roll my eyes at that kind of stuff, but like, this is
slippery slope. What's left?
You start to get, you know, we're getting closer and closer, closer than ever. And this is where I respect the hell out of defensive players that dominate. And when I respect the heck out of the Chiefs defense and what they did last year in historical context, because it is just much tougher for them to do their job in 2024 than it was in 1995. It just is, with the way the rules are set up for offense. I even saw yesterday that the NFL was concerned that scoring was down last year. Look, we all love points, but man, we don't need it. We don't need to start making this flag football for the defense.
That was from a Pro Football Talk, wasn't it?
I think so, yeah.
I think the thing that's interesting about this, and I have not played, if you look at me, if you've ever met me, I've not played a lick of tackle football, and you would assume such.
When you look at Cody and I, you're definitely thinking, man, these
flag
guys,
football for sure,
these
not
guys
tackle.
Play tackle football at a high level.
Yeah. Flag football is great. I was going nuts.
Oh,
anyways,
flag football is fun. Yeah.
All we played was tackle football as kids in the neighborhood.
But I think, yeah, which is, you could argue, maybe even more dangerous than organized the way that
I got two knee ligaments torn in backyard football, so it was more dangerous for me.
I broke my wrist. The only time I've ever broken anything. Anyways, I feel like we're trying to make a sport safer that just isn't safe in the first place, and it's never going to be that way no matter how badly we try to do it. And that's, you know, where you guys are talking about, you're on the slippery slope potentially of where does the sport look, or what does the sport look like in 10 years. I think it's hard to make a sport safer that in its foundation was never meant to really be safe in the first place. I mean, football's compared to war. It was, at least, more than it is now, but it is compared to war.
But look, you don't also, like, it can't be the most dangerous thing. It can't be, like, deep-sea fisherman levels of unsafe, right? I understand
right. But
that there's a level to all of this, and they claim that it's, I don't know, 20% or 25% more likely to cause an injury on that play versus the others. And that, again, a different tackling sport is choosing to get rid of it. So I can't assume that, like, This is just them. I'm just surprised that 99.9% of your players are like, keep it. We don't care. We know we are more likely to get hurt. We don't care. Keep them around. And I know it's not that high of a percentage, but it's a huge portion of the people who play your sport who are fine with keeping it.
Yeah, it's a weird balance because on one hand, I'm like, okay, I always get this. Like, sometimes you have to protect somebody from themselves, you know. I believe in that in a lot of things. But yes, if you're, you know, if you get to this point where you're starting to really change the way the game is played, I think that's where it becomes a slippery slope. But it's not just so much that players are against it for me, because I'm sure they're against a lot of rules that exist in the league now, you know, that we're all fine with, you know. I mean, I don't know. It's going to be fascinating. I mean, when we get to training camp and we start talking to players again and, like, what adjustments, that's even the preseason. It sounds silly because the preseason sucks, but, like, that'll be something everybody's going to be keeping an eye on. How's it officiated in the preseason? Do we start seeing that? It's like a testing ground. And if you're asking Spags, like, is this something that you're going to really have to emphasize with players now? I don't know. These are all things I would be curious to ask Spags and Justin Reed and whoever else that's going to, I mean, anybody on defense, this is going to impact. It's not even just safeties. I mean,
I'm pretty sure that 90% of Trent McDuffie's tackles are hip drop tackles, according to the way they do it. It's part of the reason we talk about how good of a tackler he is. I still think the people it's a nightmare for is, like, imagine trying to tackle Isaiah Pacheco running full steam, but you can't drop your body weight in order to do it. Well, great. Gives a benefit. Like, maybe, you know what? Maybe the one side positive impact of this will be running backs will last longer in the NFL. Because if there's one position in which this seems like it helps the most from an injury perspective, it's running back, because they're big and strong and fast and hard to bring down, because they're bigger than most of the defenders on the field. Maybe if there's anyone it helps sustain a little extra life in the league, it's them.
Coming up in 15 minutes, we'll get to the Chiefs Red Half Hour, but opening day, just a couple days away. Excited to be out at Kauffman Stadium. Also on Wednesday, we're going to be out at Rally House in Independence. So if you need to pick up some gear before opening day, Rally House is the spot to go. Independence location on Wednesday from 10 to 2. We'll be doing our show out there. We'll have a couple things for you to register to win, plus maybe some gift cards. So hope to see you guys there. And then Thursday, we'll be outside Gate D, as we are each and every opening day. And cross our fingers, so far looks like it's going to be a beautiful day for the Royals to kick off this 2024 season. 65, 66 degrees is what I said, at least I saw at last check. And we know Bobby Wood Jr., the headliner, he's got his bobblehead that everybody's going to be trying to get for opening day. And so if you look at the roster and the lineup, and now we have a good idea everybody that's going to be on the opening day roster for the most part, and Michael Massey might end up on IL today. But besides Bobby Wood Jr., if the team is to do something really special, and I understand it's going to take a lot.
Sure.
But if they're going to do something special, as in we're here in September,
and still this talking team, about them,
we're still talking about them having a shot to get in to the postseason. Who's the second most important player besides the obvious best player on your team, Bobby Wood Jr., playing at an extremely high level? Because for me, it actually might be somebody like MJ Melendez that turns into the guy that everybody thinks he can be. Like, I expect, for me, Vinny Pasquantino, sure, but MJ Melendez is the bigger variance for me, right? Like, if he's just who he's been for the first half of the last couple of seasons, okay, that's disappointing, but that's who they've been. If they're going to take the leap to go forward, all of a sudden Melendez is the guy that Vern mentioned could maybe have the ability to be a 30-plus home run guy for this team. That's the kind of stuff that swings you forward in a huge way.
That's not a bad answer. So I was kind of bouncing between rotation and position player, trying to decide what was going to hold more weight. Like, does Cole Reagans just have to be the absolute dude? Like, because I think maybe that's my answer. Like, I thought really long and hard about this. Cole Reagans is probably my answer just because of the importance of starting pitching and how much it has drug this team down for as long as it's drug them down. It's really hard to not think it's them. But if it's a position player, I think it's Vinny. And not just because he's a friend of the show, but because last year, their problems with runners in scoring position were all related to this idea that I didn't think they had any lineup protection for anybody. And that included Bobby Wood Jr., had a tremendous year. Think about how much better their offense could be if surrounding Bobby Wood Jr. were qualified major league hitters that at least go six deep. If we're talking about this team doing something cool in September, I think if it's not Cole Reagans, who would be my first choice, then it is Vinny, because they're going to need somebody on the offensive end who can carry the freight for this team for a long time. Reagans is my answer just because starting pitching matters so damn much.
Yeah, exactly. So. Yeah, I mean, if you're making me pick a non-position player, then yes, of course it's pitching, because that also we just recognized, even last season in an evaluation year, the biggest weakness of the team was pitching. And it goes without saying, you never can have too much of it. And if you're in this hypothetical, we're talking about them having a really special season. And what does that look like? Yeah, I mean, it goes without saying. I think in general, if we're really being honest, probably could have said two or three pitchers if we're being real. I mean, for the, you
I
know what I mean?
Said Reagans is the most and important, then and then Waka, yeah. And then probably Singer, and then Lugo. Yeah. And, but like, I understand that. Like before we even got to the bullpen or anything in between. But I also think when we're talking about strengths of this team, I still think if you said, hey, at the end of the year, they're a playoff team. What happened? I still think the better unit, as far as where it compares in Major League Baseball, and more importantly, where it compares in the division, is the offense. I think it's a better chance to be better than league average, you know? It is a better chance to be like the pillar. Like you mentioned, MJ Melendez and Vinny and Bobby Wood Jr. It's like, if things click for them, the ceiling is so high. Versus if everything clicks normal in the rotation, they're a really good rotation, right? But the offense could be like one of the better young offenses in baseball if it all just kind of settled in together. That's why I ended up going that side.
Yeah, as far if you were just wondering the betting markets for it to be that special season, to make the playoffs, the Royals plus 470. They are just ahead of the Angels, and then it's the White Sox and A's. The Royals are behind the Boston Red Sox, who are plus 330. So if you're just wondering where the preseason odds markets sit for them, if you think they could actually make the postseason, and yes, the win total 73.5, 74.5, depending on the book you're looking at. And maybe on Thursday, we'll give out some of our last futures bets for the Royal season. You and I both already have some bets in from at least a month and a half, 2 months ago in some cases.
Well, the odds were better than plus 470, I can tell you
yeah,
that much.
Yeah, Cole Reagans, we've talked about the strikeout numbers, definitely better odds, or there were better odds a month and a half ago when we got him at 80-1 to have the most strikeouts in the American League. And I think he's now like 20-1 or 25-1. To do that. So I'm excited for opening day, man, especially because it looks like everything's going to cooperate weather-wise and hopefully have a nice crowd. A lot of people are going to be wanting the Bobby Wood Jr. bobblehead, and I saw they're running the commercial over the weekend, the retro, like cheesy retro 80s or 90s Bobby Wood Jr. commercial.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I like those.
Oh, yeah, no, they're funny. I had seen them on social media, but I hadn't seen them on TV yet, and I saw them this weekend.
I honestly don't keep believing it because I keep checking the weather, like, every day as it gets closer. Because, as you know, the weather prediction is more accurate the closer to the actual day it gets.
Yep.
So, like, 2 weeks ago, we started checking. We're like, hey, it doesn't look too bad. And then, like, a week ago, I'm like, oh, my God, it looks incredible. And then, like, over the weekend, it was like there were some storms moving through the middle of Kansas. I'm like, oh, no. Let's not do anything crazy. Let's not screw up Thursday. See, at last check right now, the projected forecast is 66 degrees and sunny.
Doesn't get any better
for
than
March,
that.
For March, absolutely.
Dude, are that. You we've kidding?
Had some, we all know we've had some brutal opening days.
With an 8-mile-per-hour wind.
That's also key.
Yeah, not 45 or whatever the hell it was a couple of years ago.
So come by and see us either Wednesday at Rally House at Independence, get some new Royals gear ready for the start of the season, or then on opening day, maybe both. On opening day, we'll be outside Gate D. That's where we've been, I think, the last 4 years or so doing our show for opening day, except for the one day where it was 35-mile-per-hour winds, and I think we were forced to move inside, and you had to catch a flying tent. But not going to have to worry about that on Thursday.
No, I hope not. And if it does, I'm not catching it this time. It's just going to go to nature. The tent just leaves forever. It just goes off. I mean, if it's going to hit somebody, I'll stop it.
That, yeah, but, this was,
but I'm not going to go retrieve it if it just blows into the wind. It's just over.
It's just done. No more
tents.
It's
the end of the tent. If that happens, officially.
If that happened, then no more tents. Just completely done with tents on the remotes.
By the way, the text line is still hot over the college basketball.
We'll get back to that later.
They are still very fired up about it.
It's one of those sports conversations that everybody has an opinion on, right? Like, everybody feels passionately, and we can get back to that later on in the show. 913-586-7610. Up next, though, let's get back to the Chiefs. Chiefs Red Half Hour, the surprise impact player this upcoming season, according to one publication, and the disappointment that I had, at least around the L'Jarius Sneed trade.
Cody and Gold, brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
There is a back-to-back Super Bowl champion, and it is the Kansas City Chiefs.
On your official broadcast partner of the Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
Hey, it's Kling. If you're like me, sometimes a holiday just creeps up upon you, like Easter. It's just around the corner. So make Hy-Vee your one-stop shop for that perfect Easter meal. Hy-Vee has a wide variety of heat and eat meal options featuring spiral ham, turkey, or prime rib with your choice of sides. Maybe it's the mac and cheese or the mashed potatoes or stuffing. I'm hungry just thinking about it. Treat the whole family to a traditional brunch buffet at the Market Grill with all the fan favorites like eggs, bacon, sausage, pancakes, biscuits, and gravy. You hungry yet? Make this Easter the best ever, only at Hy-Vee.
Hop into Hy-Vee today for all your Easter needs. Floral arrangements, Easter baskets, candy, chocolate bunnies, gifts, and more. Spend less time in the kitchen when you choose from a wide variety of heat and eat meal options, serving as few as two or the entire crew. Treat the family to a traditional Easter brunch at the Hy-Vee Market Grill. Just $24.99 for adults, $7.99 for children, and kids 5 and under eat free. Make this your most excellent Easter ever with a little help from Hy-Vee.
Well, it's one of my favorite times of the year. We got basketball games on television all day long. That means some late nights. Some of these games not getting over till 11:30 or so. And imagine if you're a contact lens wearer and you were having those contacts in from 6 a.m. all the way till 11:30. You know that feeling. Your eyes are going to get dry. It's not healthy for you. All that is how I used to operate until I called up DuraVision and found out that I was a candidate for SBK Advanced LASIK. And after going in for that consultation where they laid out a plan that was just designed for me, not a one-size-fits-all approach, I found out that, you know what, I don't have to wear contacts or glasses, and I don't anymore after undergoing my LASIK procedure. It truly has been the best decision ever, and you can make that same decision as well by calling them up at 913-491-3330. That's 913-491-3330 for that free consultation. Or just go online to DuraVision.com and tell them Gold from 610 sent you.
Say goodbye to busted brackets because FanDuel lets you bet on every single game of the tournament. So whether you're betting on the big upset or you're picking the one seed to advance, it's time to go dancing on America's number one sportsbook app. Right now, new customers get $200 in bonus bets if your first $5 bet wins. There's nothing more exciting than having some stakes and some wagers on the tournament. So, again, whether you're picking that thrilling upset or you feel like you're going to have the perfect bracket, the best place to showcase that is my friends at FanDuel. They're giving you $200 to use on point spreads, money lines, player props. You can even pick who you think's going to cut down the nets. So visit FanDuel.com, use my promo code CDOT, and you can bet college basketball for a fun and exciting March. 21 and present in Kansas. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued in non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. FanDuel is offering sports wagering in Kansas under agreement with Kansas Star Casino, LLC. Gambling problem? Getting help is your best bet. Call 1-800-522-4700. Visit KansasGamblingHelp.com. Congratulations to the Kansas City Chiefs. Another year, another Super Bowl. Did you know that the Chiefs won their Super Bowl in their first year of their partnership with Window World? And here we are, 5 years in. The Chiefs are a dynasty, and they're still going strong with Window World as the official window of the Kansas City Chiefs. Window World windows are one of two windows with a good housekeeping seal of approval, ranked number one in number of windows sold in the country by Qualified Remodeler magazine. In just over 20 years of business, they have improved the look and thermal efficiency of over 54,000 customers right here in Kansas City. So be sure to call this number, 816-799-0820. Learn more about the double-strength glass that gives a strength that's not commonly used in replacement windows. Learn more about their products that are not only durable, but offer security, beauty, and energy efficiency. Give my friends at Window World a call. That's 816-799-0820. 816-799-0820 to learn more, or also go on the website, windowworld.com.
Getting quality employees to fill positions in your company is essential, but finding those people can be a major hassle, unless you use ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter makes finding quality people a breeze, and right now you can try it for free at ziprecruiter.com/free. With ZipRecruiter, one click sends your job to hundreds of top job sites. But more than that, ZipRecruiter's advanced technology identifies the candidates with the skills you need, sends you a list of great matches to review, then actively invites them to apply for your job. And the results speak for themselves. 4 out of 5 employers who post on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. That's right, the first day. Now you can focus on your business and let ZipRecruiter do the work finding the best people for you. See for yourself. Experience the ease, efficiency, and power of ZipRecruiter for free. Just go to ZipRecruiter.com/free. That's ZipRecruiter.com/free.
ZipRecruiter.com/free.
When people have a craving to explore new and traditional Asian cuisines, they head to P.F. Chang's, where scratch-made dishes come from the 2,000-year-old tradition of wok cooking. P.F. Chang's wanted to explore new possibilities for their website. They turned to AmericanEagle.com. AmericanEagle.com re-architected P.F. Chang's website, integrating multiple third-party systems to create a unified digital experience. The results? Improved page speed and performance, personalized content based on users' location, intuitive online ordering, an increase in organic search visibility, and a 40% increase in new users. For scratch-made Asian cuisine, visit your local P.F. Chang's or go to pfchangs.com for website design, development, digital marketing, and hosting that produce efficiency, revenue, and results. Visit AmericanEagle.com. P.F. Chang's and AmericanEagle.com. Another example of the best businesses in the world. Turning to the best in the business for websites, go to AmericanEagle.com or call 877-WEB-NOW-1. That's 877-WEB-NOW-1.
Meet Cheryl.
Hey.
She's on vacation and lost in the moment. Unfortunately, so is her Chase debit card.
It's gotta be somewhere.
Maybe she lost it at salsa night.
These skirts should have pockets.
Or maybe she lost it at Pilates.
Three and two and...
But she's not worried. With the Chase mobile app, she can lock her card till it turns up. Tools that help protect. One bank that puts you in control. Visit chase.com/checking. Chase, make more of what's yours.
Chase mobile app is available for select mobile devices. Message and data rates may apply. JP Morgan Chase Bank, NA member FDIC.
The 610 Sports Radio phone line is brought to you by Onder Law Injury Lawyers. Visit getjim.com.
Chiefs coverage brought to you by Max Motors. 9 major vehicle brands to choose from. MaxMotors.com.
Going on at all Max Ford locations.
Love it or trade it now.
0% for 72 months on new 2023 Ford F-150s in stock.
Pick your model, choose your color.
In Harrisonville, Manhattan, Richmond, Butler, and Nevada.
Hurry in while selection is best.
With approved credit expires March 31st, 24.
Chiefs Kingdom. This is Mitch Holtis, and welcome in to the Chiefs Red Half Hour on Cody and Gold. Every day at 11:30 on your official broadcast partner, the Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
It is the Chiefs Red Half Hour, and coming up in about a half hour, we'll not only get to what's trending, but we'll talk a little bit more about the stadium vote. Just outside of a week now, next Tuesday, Election Day in Jackson County, and the Royals and Chiefs did announce here in the last, I don't know, hour or so, some more details, or at least next steps, I should say. The Chiefs and Royals have acknowledged that the stadium lease agreements are now with the Jackson County Sports Complex Authority. They believe they are in their final form. Additionally, the long forms of the community benefits agreement have been sent to the Jackson County Legislature. So that's where some things stand.
You're asking for some more details on that, so maybe it's in there.
So that's something we'll talk a little bit more about in the noon hour today. But over the weekend and late on Friday night, L'Jarius Sneed was traded to the Tennessee Titans for a 2025 third-round pick and a pick swap in the seventh round this year. So the Chiefs will move up substantially, but it's a seventh-round pick. And I'll be honest, first reaction, disappointment. You know, I don't think the Chiefs got fleeced or anything like that. That's ridiculous. The market was the market. You know, the market was set, and it clearly wasn't what the reports were early. And I would bet if we got an honest answer for Brett Veach, the market maybe wasn't what they thought it was a month ago either. That's why it took a little longer maybe for the trade to happen. Remember, L'Jarius Sneed wanted a new deal on top of the trade. So it's if L'Jarius Sneed already had a, he was on a rookie deal still, well, then the compensation would have been way different. The Titans had to give up assets and commit to $55 million, now we know, guaranteed to Sneed. I was disappointed because I thought at minimum they would get a pick this year. So that's it's nitpicking. But that's what was disappointing because I think L'Jarius Sneed's a hell of a player, but it's a reminder to all of us when there's a veteran player, especially that needs a new contract, the market's never what we think it is for a player. It's just not. I mean, Jalen Ramsey a year ago went for like a second round pick and a backup tight end, or a third round pick and a backup tight end.
And he is a universally agreed upon all pro versus L'Jarius Sneed, who had his best year in his contract year. Look, I'm not trying to make the Chiefs just come off of this as like geniuses. They've done it again.
I don't think that, yeah.
But I also think if you really look at L'Jarius Sneed's entire career and everything that was on the line monetarily, the Chiefs both told you what they think of L'Jarius Sneed, like what level of player they think he is. Not, by the way, that does not mean a bad player. And the level of financial commitment they were willing to give to a player like that. L'Jarius Sneed was a really nice player in the NFL until this year when he was an all-pro caliber player for a single season and more injuries are more of a concern. Before that, he was an average. I think what it is, and this the Titans beat reporter confirmed this for me as well, I think this is the universally held belief. You remember we talked about like how Justin Fields, the whole league told you what they think about Justin Fields versus what analytics guy on Twitter might? The entire league told you that they feel the exact same way about L'Jarius Sneed the Chiefs do. He's a really good player. The end. He's not a Hall of Fame player. He's not an all-time great player. He's not the best signing we're going to make of all time. He's not an all-pro in any given year. He's a good player. And we'd like to pay a good player a pretty good amount of money. We'd like him to be on our team. But we're not going to give up the world and give up a pile of money to get him. A third round for next year feels like about the right. Like that, I'm not surprised by that compensation isn't shook down.
We're also talking about a corner. Again, the history of cornerbacks getting traded. Like, you're not getting first round picks. I mean, this is what the market is for corners. We're not talking about a quarterback. We're not talking about a wide receiver that's the best at his position.
There are a lot of people think that Chiefs got swindled.
I know.
That's the exact word the text line used.
I think what happened, this is why I said I'm disappointed. It's because go back to the beginning of March. And I think you and I had a conversation. I thought they were getting a second round pick.
I told you I'd take a third then.
Yeah,
so, I mean,
yeah, but
I thought it was a 2024 third I was discussing. Yeah, like, but yeah.
There were multiple reports. Heck, Diana Rossini, I can find the audio. We played it at one point. She was suggesting that a first round pick, a late first, was in play. Okay. So I think that's where my disappointment came. I never thought they were getting a first round pick. But the point being, there was an expectation of what you were getting back. And I think, again, it's a reminder, a veteran player that is due a big contract is not going to bring you back as much as you thought. My disappointment is mainly because it's a 2025 third round pick. And I'm like, wow, really? They had to go till next year to actually get a pick back for L'Jarius Sneed. That's what's disappointing. But it's also probably a reality of once L'Jarius Sneed's trade likelihood continued to increase, Chris Jones gets signed, the dollars that they're committing to Chris Jones. At the very beginning of the offseason, I don't know anybody that actually thought they were going to get an extension done with Jones and have Sneed on the team. And then the longer it went, people are like, oh, maybe they can do this.
But maybe they'll just eat the cap number.
With ourselves right after the Super Bowl, I don't know many people that ever thought the Chiefs were keeping Jones and Sneed for 2024. And so the market knows that as well. The market knows that you were willing to trade a player because you weren't willing to give Sneed the long-term deal. And so that hurts your market as well.
That's just the reality of it. Like, I understand this idea of like, they got screwed. Like, look at the value. And look, this is not meant to be like a knock on the person who said they got swindled. Fans tend to overvalue internal players more than the other teams do. The draft pick compensation is never what you think it should be for these players. The history of the NFL suggests. Look, every once in a while, someone makes some trade and you're like, you gave up what for who? And we're all stunned by the amount of compensation somebody will give up in order to acquire a player. The one that always stands out to me is like Jamal Adams. Somehow they got two first-round picks for a safety. That'll never make any sense to me. But that's not how the NFL typically works, especially for a player that we pointed out. Nothing about the Chiefs' actions for two consecutive years suggested that they prioritized L'Jarius Sneed over other options. To me, this is about possible extensions, more about we'd like Chris Jones here, and they prioritize that player over the other. It's fine. They're going to prioritize. They got a third round back, whatever.
Yeah, good for Sneed. I mean, late round pick.
I'm really happy he got paid.
$55 million guaranteed, and there is a lot of speculation out there about the health of his knees and all that. Hopefully that isn't something that impacts him. But the good news here is he's now guaranteed himself $55 million. That's the beautiful thing is now, like, not that he wants to get hurt, but like now you have that security. That's what it's always about. It's always about the long-term financial security when we're talking about these big-time deals. Why do players want it? They want the long-term security, and now L'Jarius
Sneed gets
that. Make
sure their kids have money for the rest of their lives.
Yeah. I did see this, though, as we were talking here, guys. I wonder, the schedule's not going to come out till May for the NFL, but we always start to see some of the international stuff come out earlier. We already know the Eagles are playing in Brazil on that Friday, maybe against Cleveland. Breer just put out an update on the international series. So the Bears and Vikings are going to host games at Tottenham. The Jags are going to have their typical game at Wembley. The Panthers will be a home team for a game in Munich. Now, the reason why I bring it up, Chiefs are scheduled to play at Carolina this coming season.
They also happen to advertise in Germany.
I don't know. Like, would they go back-to-back years? I don't know. I'm just saying. It's a possibility.
They probably would. They don't care.
It's a possibility. The Panthers are on the schedule. And the Panthers are now reportedly hosting a game in Munich. You got to say there's at least a chance now.
Yeah. I think you're going to want to put the Chiefs overseas as much as possible. And Clark Hunt.
And this time it wouldn't be a home game. So that would be nice.
Yeah.
It wouldn't count against season ticket
holders. No, because it's never a home game in the year we have eight home games versus.
That's what I'm saying. That's why it's a possibility.
That's why the schedule, like in a weird way, I know they won 18 games, but this is what I kind of like about the unbalanced schedule. Is it to me at this point, if you're in the NFL, the season you have, not, like you always have eight home games, is what you should assume. Eight home, eight on the road, one in a foreign country. Like that's how you should assume. Your schedule is every single year. Eight at home, eight on the road, one in a foreign country. I wouldn't rule it out for the Chiefs, especially because they're obviously interested in the German market. And if and Clark Hunt has been on the competition committee as regards to this a lot and has been very pro sending teams overseas. As a matter of fact, he has given up more in that department than other owners are willing to as far as number of games and how often he's gone overseas. The Jags are the only team that goes more.
Yeah, Jacksonville just loves it. Their Wembley is their second home. I mean, they just. Yeah. But yeah, Carolina. I mean, Carolina is not a sexy franchise, but overseas they know they'll have no problem if you're playing Mahomes. So we'll see. I'm not saying and reporting that the Chiefs are playing the Panthers in Munich, but it's something to keep an eye on. The schedules line up like it, they're one of the possible teams. You got to have Carolina in your schedule, which is a rarity anyway. It's part of that rotation, and it's got to be a road game, and both fit. So they're one of seven teams maybe that could be playing Carolina and Munich.
Poor Munich's going to have to watch a blowout if that's the case. So just watch a straight up ass kicking.
So the global markets are based on like the teams.
The NFL assigns you.
There or they, okay, they're assigned.
You're only allowed to advertise in certain countries. Gotcha. So the Chiefs can advertise in Mexico and in Germany and a couple in Asia. But they can't advertise in France. Somebody else has France. Somebody else has England. Yeah, if you're somebody else has
New
like,
Orleans is the only team that has France.
Yeah, like if you're in France, makes they sense. All have the Men in Black device. They're not allowed. They don't know anything about the Chiefs. They don't know Patrick Mahomes.
I know. That's all.
Could you imagine? It's like they don't know who Patrick Mahomes is in France. It's the Chiefs don't advertise.
Per Rob Collins,
no idea.
Rob went and has like a list of how it associates a little bit better than what the NFL put out. The Chiefs have Austria, Germany, Mexico, and Switzerland.
Oh, the Swiss. Huh?
There are five. There are seven teams
it's a huge
that are
market, man.
Big one.
There's seven teams that are not on the list. There's only 25. I went and counted. The Bengals are not one of them. Then there's some others as well.
wait, hold on. So wait, so you're
Bengals are one of the worst. By the way, the Bengals are one of the worst run franchises in football.
Hold on, so their owner's too cheap to spend money in advertising in another country.
Is they that got Papua New Guinea from last week.
Yeah, it's a very diverse country, as we learned.
Speak all the languages.
Well, some of the ones that stand out that I didn't know were a part of the program of the markets. The Browns have Nigeria. Okay. They're the only, at least as far as I'm looking at, the only African country that is on the list. Ireland is for the Jets. Ghana. Yeah, Ghana. The Eagles have Ghana and Australia. I wonder is this to promote the fan base along with potentially playing games there, or is this just to expand the fan base?
More the fan base part of it.
That was my ultimate.
They just eventually put teams there to play there because those teams are more willing to go places that they can.
It's the market. I mean, it is a marketing thing. But I mean, the Chiefs have opened up offices in Germany to expand. And that's what I'm like. I'm joking a little bit about your Bengals, but truly, like, why if you're a team other than being cheap, why would you not want to have an opportunity to expand your brand in another country? It's even more beneficial for the Chiefs because there's games being played in Germany.
Sure.
As of right this second, there's not, you know, the Bears have.
There's not a game in Switzerland this year.
Like the Bears now do. There's going to be a game in Madrid this year. But before the Bears, you know, marketing angle is Spain. There weren't games in Spain. There's about to be games in Madrid this year. All right. The Minnesota Vikings, Canada is just obvious because that one just fits them perfectly. They're right there. So that one, I don't have to explain to you why that one makes sense.
That's how dare you.
That one just makes sense, you know? Okay.
When are we getting a game in Switzerland? And if so, do you guys want to go?
In Switzerland?
You guys want to go to the Chiefs game in Switzerland and we can do that and see the Bern Super Collider.
I'm open to any. I have no idea.
It's just a particle accelerator.
If you had to pick a country on this list, is there a preference or one that the Chiefs are in? Like, what would you prefer?
The Chiefs between Austria, Germany, Mexico, Switzerland, and Germany looked pretty like it was a lot of fun.
Cool.
Austria is beautiful, so I mean, that one probably seems a little too small to have a game in. You know what I mean? That's probably more just a marketing. I don't think they're gonna have a game in Austria ever. Small. But to visit, just sign me up for Austria. It looks beautiful. As long as Switzerland.
Okay. Maybe you'd like seeing a particle accelerator. I don't think they'll let us in. I don't think just do like two.
The Rams are all across the Pacific. China, Japan, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand. Makes a whole lot of sense. Yeah.
Some of it is proximity. Some of it is just what these teams were willing to invest in these countries, which makes sense. I'm not even kidding. I don't just do this to pick on Drew. The Bengals are horribly run.
They're cheap.
They like.
Well, hang on a second. They're cheap, Drew.
They're cheap, you know?
Yeah, their owner might be the cheapest. He holds out his pockets and butterflies fly out is what he wants
they
you to believe.
They have done
like,
a much better job.
I'm so poor.
Once they got Joe Burrow, that's all it took for Mike Brown to finally wake up and start spending some money. They have been very good. Isn't that the consensus, though, about like what the Chiefs have been as well? They tend to run.
Mike Clark gets a little bit
closer
of that
rep. Pockets.
Not as much as the Bengals, but I'm not saying that's.
Mike Brown is notorious. That is something that they have had attached to their name for, I guess, the entire history, because the Brown family has been in charge of the Bengals the entire time with Paul and now Mike as well. They're better now, though, guys. They're better now.
Now people are saying, well, we can visit in Austria. We can go see where the Sound of Music
was. That's right.
You know, really? For a while there was a couple of people who called us the Von Taps because the Von Traps,
hey.
Seven kids, same boy to girl ratio.
Like that.
Seems close enough.
Drew, have you seen the Sound of Music?
Yes, a very long time ago.
I was going to say, have you heard of the Sound of Music? I was about to go one step further.
Yes, I have heard of it and I have seen it.
Okay. That's a name, man.
Is that a blue blood family, you think?
The Von Trapps? God, yes. Are you kidding?
I think so.
Actually, when's the last time they mattered?
That's true.
They might be like the Indiana of blue blood families when you think about it. When's the last time a Von Trapp?
There are no Gonzaga, that's for sure.
The Vanderbilts, a long time ago, but.
You know, the Carnegie, you know, like some of these are like, what is it? Are you still in the mix of the elite?
Uh-huh.
Or were you just at one point in the mix? That's a different show.
I'm sure that'd be a fun conversation as well.
All right, let's get back to the Chiefs a little bit.
Oh, God, this is the Chiefs Red Half Hour?
It is. Well, we were talking Chiefs in relation to the international schedule and the Panthers maybe hosting.
Sorry, we just got distracted.
Anyway, Andy Reid at these league meetings going on, you know, these coaches are talking a little bit, and Andy was asked about Steve Spagnuolo again because we know we had Spags on the show, and that was at that point in time before we knew that the 49ers had really aggressively tried to get him to become their defensive coordinator. He was asked basically how close did he think Steve Spagnuolo was to leaving for just another defensive coordinator job. And here's the quote. He was on the last year of his deal, so I think his dream was to become a head coach and still is. Hopefully he has that opportunity next year to do that. So it didn't work out that way, so we just jumped on it knowing that teams were going to be coming after him. There were a couple that came after him. I wasn't asking questions. I was just trying to get it done. That's Andy, again, confirming that maybe multiple teams were trying to get Spags to leave to be a DC, and the Chiefs obviously were not letting that happen. And parade morning, that was the day the deal for the extension was announced.
Like, if you're Spags, other than if it's the same, like, Eric Bieniemy argument, unless you just think you need to go to a new town to convince someone to make you a head coach, and because he's the defensive coordinator, it makes no sense. Your best chance to become a head coach again if you're Steve Spagnuolo is to stay with the Chiefs. So if they're going to pay you top of the mark, and they did, well, then there's no reason to go somewhere else. The real thing that I'm stuck on here now is because he talked about it. He had said, you know, like, I feel like he began the thing he normally does with OCs, Gold, where he said, like, oh, this guy deserves to be a head coach. He wants to be a head coach again. I hope he gets that chance. If they won a third straight Super Bowl, they were the first team ever to three-peat. And the defense was, again, a big reason why. They don't have to be the better unit. They were just another big reason why they went on to three state Super Bowls. Does he at least get an interview? He hasn't even had an interview to be a head coach.
Yeah, I think he was
in a room.
I think you would have to get an interview at that point. I don't know if he's ever going to be a head coach again, but I think if you made history and in this hypothetical, the defense was one of the best again in the league, I mean, you would be completely foolish to not at least, you know what? Let me see. Who's, you know, the team that's done something that's never happened in football history, won three in a row. Oh, and his defense, at least for two of them, were top five, top 10. Might want to talk to the guy that's in charge of that defense. I would think he would at least get an interview, yes. I don't know about a head coaching gig, but I think he would at least get an interview, or at least should. I keep saying that.
The NFL hiring cycle doesn't go anywhere near older defensive coordinators.
That part, not even just that, the part that's probably holding him back is also the timeline. You know, if the Chiefs are in the Super Bowl again next year,
a lot of
stuff is figured out before you get there. You know, a lot of the interviews take place before. Now, they changed some rules in the last year, I think, that you,
it's after the wild card,
correct,
or something, but it's still not after the Super Bowl, which is as far deep as the Chiefs go. I kind of think he won't. I don't think it's fair. I would point out that if I were a team, I would entertain Spags as a head coach for the same reason. Like, I don't understand why Dennis Allen gets another shot or Josh McDaniels got another shot when their first runs could go so miserably bad that they would get another opportunity other than age, right? I get
That's
it.
That's a big part of it, yeah.
But, like, Spags has a claim to be the single greatest defensive coordinator in NFL history. Only one to win it with multiple franchises, now won multiple with the Chiefs. Like,
he'll have the strongest case for any coordinator to make it to the Hall of Fame. We've never had one, but he would have the strongest case.
And then he has the Antonio Pierce argument, which is his players would lay down on the sword for him. They die for Spags, right? That's got to say something about the guy. This was the problem you'd mentioned with Eric Bieniemy in Washington, is that a lot of his players are speaking out against his tactics. No one, and I mean no one, has a single negative thing to say about the job Steve Spagnuolo does as a coach. Like, if he makes it that far, I hope he gets an interview. He deserves an interview. He's made it clear. He said on this show, like he said on a million shows, he would like another crack at being an NFL head coach. But part of me thinks that it would take at least that extreme gold to get in the room. I almost feel like they'd have to win the title again to get in the room. Like, if they just have a good year and they lose in the AFC title game, because that's the shortest distance they go, they lose in the AFC title game, I'm not sure that's going to get him enough calls, or maybe gets him an interview.
Yeah, again, I don't think he gets a head coaching gig again, but I could see an interview if he ends up having another dominant defense. And the way things, I know they just traded L'Jarius Sneed, but the fact that Chris Jones is back, they're probably going to have a top 10 defense. I don't know if they'll be top three again, but they're going to have a top 10 defense. I think
that's
they're already trending
right now
in that direction.
Like, see some more defensive line and just be sure, but sure.
Yeah, and they still have the draft, right? So who knows what they ultimately do there. But I thought that was interesting from Andy Reid, and especially here that multiple teams, which makes sense, right? I mean, his contract was expiring, so if you're running, why wouldn't you want to? I mean, the same reason why we're saying he should be getting the looks as a head coach, obviously, if you had a chance to steal what was the best coordinator in football last year, you would do it. And the Chiefs were like, yeah, that's not happening.
I like Shannon. Shannon was so desperate. Like, please, Spags, I'm begging. Come here. Like, I'm trying to think about what's the last older defensive coordinator who got a job?
Wade Phillips, right? Would that have been it? I mean, that's the one that comes to mind.
Think about what he's fighting in that room. Like, I mean, I remember, like, the Bengals defensive coordinator was getting some talk there for a while, and even he's never gotten a job. Like, even he never got hired away. They've had... You know, like,
Wade Phillips is the name that comes to mind, but I don't know.
There might be someone in between. Like, Antonio Pierce is a defensive, maybe it's Dennis Allen. Is he a defensive minded coach? I guess him.
Yeah. Yeah. Lou Anarumo, who we're thinking of in Cincy.
Yeah.
He was getting a ton of praise before last year.
And it's probably his fault Burrow got hurt, you know? That's why. This is the thing about defensive coach.
We are not blaming Lou Anarumo.
No, but that's the point I think I'm trying to make about the coaching stuff is that things could go wrong for a team that the things that went wrong for the Chiefs this year had nothing to do with Spags. But if they have come up shorter than they did, it had been even less likely he would get a job as an NFL head coach. It had nothing to do with the job he did. You're just riding such an impossible uphill battle.
Someone said,
in order to even be considered in this.
Fangio, that's the most recent example, by
the way.
That did
not go great.
Did not. Great defensive coordinator. Broncos gave him a shot.
Mm-hmm.
Not great. Although, in fairness, since he's been fired, it's not like things got any better for the Broncos.
Else. Like, if Spags ended up taking a head coaching job in which the starting quarterback was...
Jake Browning.
Probably not going to go great. If he gets a starting job in which the guy is, you know...
Actually, Spags loved Jake Browning, by the way.
Did he
praised him and Brock Purdy.
Yeah.
Ooh. Those are two quarterbacks like you. Yeah, he went.
He gushed him.
Out of
well,
the
maybe
way.
The
he
Jake
went out
Browning
of his
is
way.
A little bit. Uh-huh. But, you know, if Will
Levis
is his starter, it's probably not going to go great.
That's true.
Like, some of it is like, you know.
Always. No, that's and that's where it's like these coaches, when they be, you know, they get, you got basically 2 years to show you got it. If not, you're out the door. And if you don't have the right quarterback, we know it's that simple sometimes. It really, like, it can be that simple. That's why, like, DeMeco Ryan, I also think, is just a really good head coach. But it helps that he's got C.J. Stroud, who looks like the real deal right away. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
can't hurt.
Like, Josh McDaniel might have screwed it up, but, like, DeMeco Ryan's now got C.J. Stroud, and his defense improved drastically under him, and he's a defensive-minded guy.
I think Drew's
catching some heat.
Yeah, a little bit. He's also forming friendships. Some guy who says he's a His wife's a Bengals fan, so, you know, maybe they're...
You said keep the Joe Shiesty energy coming?
That's right. Somebody said... somebody texted in, I hope Joe comes back.
Shiesty.
Somebody texted... Yeah, that is the best nickname that Joe Burrow has. Somebody texted in, I hope Joe comes back and puts an end to this. Chiefs fans are getting cocky. And I responded, keep the...
It's unfortunate for Burrow that the best Joe nickname is already taken in Joe Cool.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that is the best Joe nickname, but it was already taken by a different quarterback.
People have said Joe Cool for Joe Burrow. I'm like, you can't repeat the nickname. You just can't. It's not.
You never be able to call someone Magic Man again. You know, that's Mahomes' forever, according to Pro Football Reference.
You can't use the same nickname.
Can be repeated if the player is not one of the best to play at the position. You know what I mean? Like, but once that becomes a legendary player, you can't reuse the nickname. It's
correct.
Over. It's just over.
Especially with somebody that flashy as well.
You're not going to call another player Magic.
Yeah. Just no, you're not.
That's it. That's the one player. Someone says Joe Burr is the best.
Actually, no. You know what? That might be
the best. I actually like that one better. Joe Shiesty. Burr.
Excuse me?
That's how they say it. Well, it's not Joe Burr.
Go ahead.
Joe Burr.
Are you sure that's how they say it?
Yes, you have to roll the R's.
That's worse, though. It was cool just saying Joe Burr.
It was better the way I said it than Joe Burr. No, that just makes it sound like I'm a purring cat.
It is definitely better the second. Yes, exactly.
That's Bengals.
It is better the second way you said it.
That's why they do it, but I think it is. Yeah. Okay.
Cats are like soft and cuddly and nice. That's not what you want. You want cutthroats when it comes to football.
That's funny. And as somebody
corny
texted,
Joe. Yes. That's
somebody
true.
Texted in. Well, my wife always says whenever she sees Joe Burrow, and that's Macaulay Culkin. That's Macaulay Culkin.
Yeah, Kevin
Culkin.
McAllister.
Yes.
You got a little bit of that vibe.
Totally. Yeah. Next, we'll get to what's trending, the latest on the stadium vote that's a week out, and some new numbers coming in.
Cody and Gold, brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
There is a back-to-back Super Bowl champion, and it is the Kansas City Chiefs.
On your official broadcast partner of the Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
GAN Asphalt and Concrete is here for all of your parking lot needs, especially as you're starting to hit summer or you saw some of that spring weather start to wreak havoc on it. They're one contractor, all things parking lot. GAN's going to take care of your project from day one. You're going to call my guy like Nathan over there and he'll be like, hey, what does it look like? These curbs don't look good. Do I need to call somebody else? Do you have a guy who does seal coating? No, they do all of it. They'll redo your drainage system, your bumper blocks. If you need ADA ramps, it doesn't matter what the project is. Relating to parking lots, they will take care of it from the very beginning to the very end. Do you know that, like, it's the first sign anybody sees of your business? I always think about that as I drive through these, like, place I got to go with my kids. Like, for a while, we're going to soccer, and I'm like, the parking lot is a mess. Makes you feel like the place you're going to is not that nice. You don't want people thinking about that when they come to your business. You want them thinking about what they're going to get from the experience from the inside. And if the first impression from your business is a bad one, that's where you start running into these problems. They'll give you a free estimate and give you an idea of what it would cost to take care of these projects for you. But over at GAN, they've been working in the Kansas City area for 30 years. They're celebrating their 30th anniversary just this year. If you want to see what people are saying about their work, just go to GANasphalt.com. That's G-A-N-N Asphalt.com. And you can see for yourself why people stand behind them. Trust a contractor who's been in the city for 30 years, a local company serving you. That's GANasphalt.com.
Rally House, shop every team in town, college and pro.
Play ball, KC. Shop the latest in Royals style with your favorite brands and throwback designs. Rally House has gear for every fan.
Kansas, Missouri, Kansas State. Chiefs and Royals make KC great.
Rally House, Rally House. It's your city, it's your house. It's a Rally House.
Shop home run styles in-store and online at rallyhouse.com.
Hey guys, B-Dub here from Fesco in the Morning. You've been waiting to start your weight loss program. It's time to embrace the revitalizing energy of the season and jumpstart your weight loss journey. Time to get the dad bod in shape. Slim for Life wants to help. This is the last week featuring their lowest prices of the year during their friends and family sale. This is how I'm losing the weight. I hooked up with my girl Leanne at the 119th Metcalf location. Her and her crew put together a program for me, and it is working to perfection. I've now lost the equivalent of 4 truck tires in just 8 months. You can be down 20 pounds or more in your first month. Seize this perfect opportunity to begin with a free consultation. Let them know that you heard it from B-Dub, and you can take advantage of the Friends and Family Sale, the lowest pricing of the year, for one more week. It all starts with that consultation. Make the life-changing call like I did. 833-SLIM today. That's the number you need to call. 833-754-6863. Or you can hit them online at slim, the number 4life.com. All services included. Exclusive of products. What are you waiting for? Make the call. Tell them B-Dub sent ya.
Say goodbye to busted brackets because FanDuel lets you bet on every game of the tourney. Whether you're betting on a big upset or a one seed, it's time to go dancing on America's number one sportsbook. Right now, new customers get $200 in bonus bets if your first $5 bet wins. You gotta love the 12 seeds beating the 5 seeds. And let's check out Kansas. They could be primed for an upset. That's $200 to use on point spreads, money lines, and you can even pick who's gonna win it all. Just visit FanDuel.com/610Bob and bet on college hoops until they cut down the nets. 21 and present in Kansas. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued is non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. FanDuel is offering online sports wagering in Kansas under an agreement with Kansas Star Casino, LLC. Gambling problem? Getting help is your best bet. Call 1-800-522-4700 or visit ksgamblinghelp.com.
Gates Barbecue is sure to please your palate for lunch or dinner. Gates sauces and seasonings can be ordered online at GatesBarbecue.com or stop by any of their 5 locations and bring Gates sauces and seasonings home today. Whether a family get-together or entertaining friends from out of town, it all goes best with Gates Barbecue. And nothing says Kansas City barbecue like the great flavors of Gates Barbecue, a Kansas City tradition.
Hey, it's Rex here with RexBuysKC.com, your local KC home buyer. If you own a property in the Kansas City or surrounding area and want to sell it fast and at a fair price, write this number down, 816-330-6000. I'm a private real estate investor, not some hedge fund or large national chain. My family and I live right here in KC. I can pay cash and close on your timeline, even in as little as 3 days. Here at RexBuysKC.com, we are improving Kansas City one house at a time. I buy inherited houses, vacant houses, foreclosure houses, behind in payment houses, my tenant won't pay the rent houses, and properties that need complete rehabs. Do you own a house that's trashed and needs thousands of dollars in repairs? Great. If you own a house and want to sell it fast, call me at this number, 816-330-6000. That's 816-330-6000, or go to RexBuysKC.com. That's RexBuysKC.com, and I look forward to working with you.
I'm still going for it, even with higher stroke risk from atrial fibrillation and a regular heartbeat not caused by a heart valve problem. Over a 3-year study, Eliquis apixaban tablets reduced stroke risk better than warfarin, and over 97% of Eliquis patients did not experience a stroke. A first stroke occurred in 2.9% of warfarin patients versus 2.3% of Eliquis patients.
Don't stop taking prescription Eliquis without asking your doctor. It may increase your stroke risk. Eliquis can cause serious and, in rare cases, fatal bleeding. Don't take Eliquis if you have an artificial heart valve, abnormal bleeding, or antiphospholipid syndrome. While taking, you may bruise more easily or take longer for bleeding to stop. A spinal injection while on Eliquis increases risk of blood clots, which may cause paralysis, the inability to move. Get medical help right away for unexpected bleeding, unusual bruising, or tingling, numbness, or muscle weakness. Medications such as aspirin products, NSAIDs, SSRIs, SNRIs, and blood thinners may increase bleeding risk. Tell your doctor about all planned medical or dental procedures. Learn more at Eliquis.com or call 1-855-ELIQUIS.
This March, Wendy's has some amazing deals on their hamburgers made with fresh, never frozen beef.
Like a juicy Dave's single for $1 and a fresh $2 Dave's double with in-app offer.
It's such a good deal, we wrote a little ditty about it.
Get it for $1. Dave's single, order in the app. Dave single, get it for $1. Choose wisely, choose Wendy's official hamburger or March Madness.
Limited time offer, participating U.S. Wendy's. See offer details and redeem at Wendy's app. Account registration required. Fresh beef available in the contiguous U.S. and Alaska.
eBay Motors is here for the ride. Go ahead, feel your engine. Admire that perfectly installed exhaust. Your vehicle's moving along this freeway like it was made from fresh installs and a whole lot of love. With eBay Motors, you get over 122 million parts to keep it running. And with eBay Guaranteed Fit, they'll be the perfect fit every time. Plus, at these prices, well, we're burning rubber, not cash. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions apply.
You're listening to 610 Sports Radio from the Mission Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling Studios.
Subscribe to the 610 Sports KC YouTube page for exclusive video content from Cody and Gold on your official broadcast partner of the Chiefs and your home for Royals baseball.
610 Sports Radio.
KCSB Kansas City. WDAF HD2 Liberty. Always live on the free Odyssey app. What's trending?
All right, let's check in on the hot topics. Trending.
Number one on what's trending, we know the NCAA tournament field of 16 is now set. The Jayhawks got eliminated over the weekend by the Gonzaga Bulldogs. So now on Thursday, four games, including both number one seeds on Thursday. UConn taking on San Diego State, UNC Alabama, two seed Arizona against the six seed Clemson Tigers, and then Iowa State out of the Big 12 taking on three seed Illinois. Then on Friday, we still have the four number ones, so two more number ones on Friday. Purdue will take on the Zags, Houston, Duke, and then Marquette, the two seed, will go up against 11 seed NC State on Friday night. And then the late game on Friday will be number two Tennessee, number three seed Creighton. So that's your Sweet 16. We'll talk a little bit more about this later in the show, but I think it's been a fun tournament, man. I know we don't have as many of the higher seeds that we had last year going to the Sweet 16, but we had some first round upsets, and we've had definitely some cool moments where we all remember with, you know, some great shots at the buzzer. Like last night, Houston ended up winning, so there wasn't an upset, but it was still a great game at the end and moment with the Aggies tying it up and going to overtime.
And I think some of the arguments you can make is, I think Creighton as a three seed is just as good as most of the one seeds. Not UConn, who I think is the best team obviously remaining. But I do think a lot of those higher seeds remaining in the Sweet 16 are as good as some of the others. Next up on Watch Trading, the Royals have said that the completed full detailed CBA is in the hands of Jackson County, as well as the leased terms that would be on vote for, what, 1 week from tomorrow? They've also spent another $500,000 each into the Vote Yes ad campaign. That brings it up to $3 million in total spending for those teams. We're going to talk more about that in a minute, but Royals and Chiefs still going hard after that vote.
Week to go.
In 8 days.
Week to go. Next up on What's Trending, we're seeing some movement coaching-wise in college hoops now that more teams, of course, season have come to an end. Stanford has agreed to a deal with Washington State head coach Kyle Smith. Kyle Smith had a great year at Wazoo, but now, remember, Washington State doesn't have a conference technically next year, and so you got to move while you can. Stanford's in the Big Ten. Also, one other movement just in the last 20 minutes, Danny Sprinkle, he's the head coach of Utah State. The Aggies won the regular season in the Mountain West. He was there for 1 year, and he's leaving to go to Washington, who's in the Big Ten. So,
and in the last 8 minutes, James Madison's head coach, Mark Byington, is heading off to Vanderbilt.
There you go.
Literally just
got to strike while the iron's hot, man. Last night, Drake's head coach left for West Virginia.
Louisville,
and he's taking his son. He's taking his son, obviously.
Yeah,
it was the best.
Louisville going after.
It was Dusty May. Like, everybody was in, and then Dusty May flipped and went to Michigan. My dad's excited about that one. But Louisville, maybe they go after Bryce Drew from Grand Canyon. They wanted Scott Drew, so go get his brother.
Just get a different Drew.
Yeah, in terms of smaller school guys that are next to be hired, Bryce seems to be the next guy.
Yeah, he does seem to be. He's got a nice program there. They've done quite a bit of winning. Next up on What's Trending, Welsh rugby star. We're talking about the hip drop tackles. So rugby twice in one show. Luis Rees Zamet, I think Zamet. I don't know how he's pronounced it. One of the more high-profile international names in there. He's in that pathway program for the NFL. He's going to visit the Broncos tomorrow or today. And the Chiefs tomorrow. He actually visited with two other teams, the Browns and the Jets, today. He ran a 4.41 in an open tryouts for NFL teams. They say he would try out for either wide receiver or running back or kick returner. He plays the same position I played in rugby, you know, so.
I think this is smart. They're bringing him in to teach them how to tackle without the hip drop. That's what it is. Genius.
This man's going to do it?
He's in charge,
actually. This is a huge deal because he's a star. He's a young star in rugby. And he was like, screw rugby, I have a dream of playing in the NFL.
Make
so he's
going
to see if he can figure out a way to make his way through the
NFL.
Can
he make more money? Or some of the biggest rugby stars, I imagine, make really good money, too. I don't know.
Probably. I mean, it's an international sport, so I would presume.
Okay.
But if his dream is to play in the NFL.
Let him be running back.
I'm the Chiefs because it's a super entertaining camp storyline that this Welsh rugby star is on the team trying to make it through.
Isaiah Pacheco's backup right there.
Running back.
This is Isaiah Pacheco's running back?
4-1.
Backup.
4.41.
He's fast, man. He said he was disappointed. He said he was running in the high 4.2s last week. That was his exact quote.
Well, and rugby players, you know, they're big dudes.
Some of
quads
are
big. Like, and not to say that he's like a smaller running back, but if this dude runs a 4.2, and I don't know if
they're all Saquon Barkley in terms of the lower body strength.
So he doesn't, you know, like the position he plays, Drew, is the equivalent to like fastest guy on the field, if that makes sense, right?
Okay.
He only weighs like 200 pounds. He doesn't, you know.
Still, bring this guy in as the running back, as the backup, the spell. Here you go.
He's 6'3", 194
He makes equivalent of $285,000 a year right now.
Oh, dude, he can make triple that just by making league
men. Just being the third string running back.
A 6'3 running back. Oh, my goodness.
It's like something you see in a video game. Yeah. You create a player, and you make your running back 6'6", 240.
He's barreling guys over like Derrick Henry while also running.
6'3", 200 is not small for running a 4.44.
No. There you go. That's what's trending here on Cody and Gold. As you said, we'll get back into the Royals and Chiefs stadium stuff, because I wanted to talk a little more about that. We know we're a week plus out now. Tomorrow will be a week from question one being on the ballot. I know early voting's already going on, but in terms of actual election day, and you mentioned the dollar amount, but the Royals and Chiefs putting in, according to the Missouri Ethics Commission, their campaign, $500,000 into that. Makes sense. I'm imagining they're putting out more and more ads inside of a week of the election. It's now up to 3 million. Someone did the math, and with the inflation, basically, the prior campaign that they did, the equivalent would have been like spending, I think, $2.3 million back in, 08 or whatever the last vote was. So if you're wondering, like, how different is the spending from then, not terribly far off from where it was. I don't know if it tells us one thing or the other. My guess is they were always going to buy advertising a week out of the election, no matter how the perceived social media was going. You know, it turns
more
out
money.
It turns
you
out
sure.
Yeah, I think so. I don't think Twitter doesn't decide the election, you know, so and how things go, it turns out.
No, look, I don't think that I would say the last place you should look if you're deciding which way this vote's going to go is a social media channel. That's not going to give you an apt idea of where the voters stand.
I don't think it's insignificant that they just
keep throwing a half a million in week, and then they get to a new week and they're like, yeah, let's get another mill in there, another half mill each, and keep buying. That means to me they think the vote is close.
Well, I think
I don't think it means they think they're losing. They just think it's close, and they want to make sure that their momentum, you know.
Yeah, I also think it's close. I mean, we've been saying that for 2 months. Like, I don't think either side, whoever ends up, quote unquote, winning, no campaign or yes campaign, like, I don't think either side's winning by a huge margin. I think it's going to be very, very close. If you're on the yes side and you think it's just going to win in a landslide, I think that's inaccurate. And if you're on the no side and you think you guys are going to blow it out of the water as well, like, I don't think so on that. I think it's going to be very, very close. And the ad spend thing doesn't really, to me, tell the story. Like, I think it's a campaign for a very important issue for two teams. So if you factor in an extra $500,000 for each, is not crazy at all. Like, they're buying ads on every platform and every channel possible. So
radio, TV.
Well, I mean, that's expensive. Like,
yeah, they've got ads running on the station.
They do, as a matter of fact.
How much of a half mil are we getting? Like the show.
Yeah, we're getting so. Well, I've been told. Remember, John Sherman.
You're bought and paid for.
That's true. John Sherman and Clark Hunt each week write me a new check. It's a great deal, according to some of you on social media and Twitter. So, no.
Someone says they don't need money from the county to buy their ads with the stadium. Look, $3 million into a between the two teams, it's like $3 billion worth of projects. It's not. It might buy the RV charging ports.
Yeah. And again, I'll point out the Royals ownership is committing $1.3 billion dollars to the stadium project.
It's like what, a $2.5 billion project between the two? 2.6, whatever it is, 2.7 between the two teams. I don't know that $3 million was really gonna move the needle.
No, I think it's gonna be close, man. We're gonna continue to see. I think, you know, maybe Jonathan Katz from Fox 4 will be on the show tomorrow, get his perspective. He's done a great job talking to those in the Crossroads in particular. I think there was a survey I saw from just the Downtown Neighborhood Association. On that polling, it was overwhelmingly no.
Yep.
Now, that is, I don't know what the exact number of people, but that was a Downtown Neighborhood Association poll, and it was overwhelmingly no. As we know, it's not just downtown that's voting on this, though, but I thought that was interesting to see. But
and I would assume I think, that's the group that's the least interested in
it. And both sides are confident. I mean, we heard members of the KC Tenants were on with Carrington last week, and you can tell if you were to ask Royals and Chiefs people as well, both sides are confident that they're going to win. But I don't think either side should feel like they're going to win in a landslide. I would be stunned if it's 58% on either side.
Last week, Fox 4 said that they obtained polling data for both teams about the yes or no vote on this. And the results were 47 yes, 46 no.
Close, man.
7% undecided with a margin of 3.5% variance one way or the okay. other. So it was that one was 506 respondents of 5% live downtown. So, I mean, like, who knows?
Yeah. Polls are fun
and
to talk about.
People's kind of crazy when you think about, like, hundreds of thousands that could potentially vote in this. And I don't know what turnout they're expecting, but, like, I feel like the money's not nothing, but yes, I would have assumed they were spending money anyway. It's that they have to keep putting money into the coffers tells me, all right, it's close, and we can't stop spending now.
Well, why would you stop inside of a week anyway?
Well, I just meant like maybe the $500,000 would have been enough to carry you. I don't think they would have run no ads. It's just, was that last $500,000 enough? And they're like, nope, a little bit more for this final push. One more spend of $1 million in ads over the next 8 days, and let's find out if that gets us the vote in a week on a week from Tuesday. By the way, continue. You can vote now.
Mm-hmm.
If you want an early vote in Jackson County, that is available to you. Just look it up on our website. Someone says, I just want this process to be done. It's like, yeah, duh. Look,
I think a lot of people are fatigued with the issue. I agree.
It gives us things to talk about. There's no doubt. But also, like, I am fatigued with it in the sense that I just kind of want to know the results. I know the reasons why people don't want it. I know the reason why people do want it. I understand the pros and cons. I know there's no new information now that the community benefits agreement is at. Like, everything I need to know is pretty much out there at this point. So I just want to see what the results are. Because then comes the guessing game next if it doesn't pass.
Oh, that's a whole different conversation. Yeah, if we're here on next Wednesday and it fails the night before, then, I mean, truly every option is on the table. And that's why, like, whole deal, like, oh, they're threatening or whatever. I just think it's reality. Like, basically, you're voting on whether or not you want to risk both or one of the teams leaving Jackson County. That's how, that may be oversimplifying it for some of you, but that to me is what you're deciding. If you're cool or not with risking the possibility of them leaving Jackson County. I don't think that's a threat when it's just kind of reality of how we've seen these projects go. Like,
it's a threat. It's just not an empty one, you know?
I mean, I guess. I mean,
they're threatening to leave, but it's not an empty threat. Like, I think the people who are like, they'd never leave us, they will. They will.
Yeah, but also, like, to me, the reason why I guess I don't categorize it as a true threat, because now if you're in Jackson County, it clearly is something that you're passionate about, but the Chiefs or the Royals, to me, I'm not worried about them leaving the Kansas City region. You know, like, and if
sure.
it fails, there's a chance the Chiefs stay in Missouri and the Chiefs stay in Missouri. But there's also a chance that one of them goes to Kansas. There's certainly a chance that one of them goes to a different county, at least. You know, that's to me what will be fascinating about next Wednesday or next Tuesday night.
Because my quick assumption, like, and let's just say, like, this is the conversation next Wednesday. My quick assumption is that if it failed, the Chiefs would immediately start entertaining Kansas, and the Royals would try a three-prong approach. They would entertain a separate ballot measure that was just them in Jackson County, maybe at the current site, maybe in the East Village site, if they thought they would get more traction there from voters. They would go back to Clay and kick that thing around because it was the next closest county, and then they would also call Kansas.
Yeah, I think what would be, because then the battle of, if you're the state of Missouri, we know they lost the Rams, and are you letting another NFL team leave your state?
Yeah.
And so is that where all of a sudden at the state level there's some more involvement if this thing fails, specifically with the Chiefs? I don't know if the eastern side of the state necessarily cares about what the Royals are doing, considering they have the Cardinals. But the NFL, losing an NFL team twice, I think that's something that at the state level the governor's office, at least every indication, doesn't want to have happen. I think no matter what happens, they're going to need state help anyway, even if this thing passes on April 2nd.
Yeah, they don't have really a choice. They're going to – and look, that's the smaller of the hurdles, if that makes sense.
Someone says, would the thoughts be the same if the tax was spread across other counties? We've discussed that. It's just not, I don't think it's something that I would be all about, a by state, or I guess if you're just talking about counties in Missouri, sure. But yeah, by state, the Union Station was the last by state tax we've had. No, I've told you, look, you live not in Jackson County, but you're on the Missouri side. I live in Kansas and I'm in Johnson County. I would absolutely be fine in support if you told me that it was a ballot measure that involved Johnson County, Wyandotte County,
Clay,
Platte, like, you know, whatever counties you think.
It's a by-state tax situation, yeah. but with a county thing yeah. based on the teams that support it.
For me, that is the quote-unquote, if we're actually fairest thing from if it's going to be public money. There's been no indication that it ever is really on the table at all.
And the argument has always been from the Chiefs and Royals side. I'll just play their side of the conversation for a minute. Is it, in a lot of ways, it is. It will always cost Jackson County residents more. And again, I lived in Jackson County for, I don't know, 20 years or whatever. It always cost Jackson County more because you're a resident there. Sure. You're going to spend more of your money there more often. Their argument is that everyone's still going to pay for it because it's a sales tax. Every time Gold steps foot into Jackson County and spends any money in Jackson County, he will be helping pay for the stadium. Whether he goes to the stadium or just simply enters the county and spends money. He goes to Anthony's downtown for a nice dinner. He great is spot. Helping pay for the stadium. I specifically chose a place I knew you
great
liked.
Spot. Love so that place. Was, one of my favorite restaurants in the city, Anthony's. Seriously, it is. Great, great vibe. Love it. Big fan. Drew, we got to get you out to Anthony's once. Great vibe. Perfect date spot for you and the wife. Oh, yeah. How was the anniversary?
Where'd you guys go?
Yeah, thank you.
You can tell us now.
I can tell you guys later. It was good.
Tell us later.
Where'd you guys go?
And it wasn't anything like special.
It's a secret.
Like that. It was good.
I saw you were watching the tournament on Friday, bowling.
So the anniversary was Thursday. Wife didn't have a good day at work on the anniversary. So she was like, let's do it on Friday.
Gotcha. Sure.
We ended up going to main event.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
And then I've been multiple times. We've been to Boulevard Brewing. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to convince her to, like, take an afternoon to just go and hang.
Nice.
Because she has not been there
nicer.
Yet.
Yeah, sit outside.
Have a cocktail, yeah.
Look, I obviously my kids like places like Main Event. I actually, this weekend, because we're not going anywhere, it's my kids' spring break this week. And we're not going anywhere for spring break like some families do because we got a bunch of stuff planned in the summer. So I was like, well, I'll go take them to do something. So I went and took them to like a Northland equivalent to Main Event. And I'm always a little like, is this cost? Is this equitable? Is this number?
Of course not. No, of course not.
My God, it's just
it's not.
It's like I was the entire time I was there when I got done, I thought, okay, so like.
Cody, that whoopee cushion should not cost $30.
No,
you're correct.
It's not even the games, right? So the place near here, they have like a wristband pass where you can bowl or swing in a giant foam pit or play laser tag. Or do giant go-karts.
Makes sense.
Or little kiddie bumper cars. And that doesn't include any, like, none of the arcade games. But for, like, $25 for 3 hours, you can do all those things. Or shoot pool. But
that
like,
actually sounds like a great
imagine,
deal.
Imagine my kids.
That
imagine
sounds
like a
pretty good
shoot
deal.
Pool. But the problem was, is what I realized very quickly was the issue was, some of those things they simply cannot do without an adult. So I'm not just in for their 20. So, like, the big go-karts. Sure, those look like fun for a kid. I can't drive them. Not only do they can't be 48 inches tall, which my daughter is close to now. They'd be 58 inches tall. They got to be damn near 5 feet tall.
You got to go to the bumper cars instead. Mm.
But they sucked. It was just two of them, dude. It was like babies riding it. So those were like, this is pretty lame. They're just driving in a circle. Not super cool. The real go-karts, way more fun.
Sure.
So, of course, I had to buy a $25 wristband. My kid was too afraid. The youngest one was too afraid to go in the laser tag area. So all of a sudden now I'm in with my, I'm like, oh man, this is a, but $25, I'll be honest. The deal there wasn't bad.
Yeah, that doesn't sound
I think if
bad.
You tried to also pay for arcade time, you'd be like, this is a racket.
If you're telling me for $25, you got to do go-karts and laser tag and the jungle gym thing or whatever.
It's like a giant, the foam pit was not for adults. That was specifically for kids.
Yeah. But the fact for your kids though, for $25 bucks to do all three, I don't think that's
you
that bad of a
unlimited?
Deal.
Although I'll be,
for three
unlimited.
Hours.
I'll be honest. If like. I think sometimes we're doing like bachelor parties wrong. You cannot tell me that if you just rented out that whole place.
That would be awesome.
Dude, it'd be badass as an adult. If you just said we got to drink a bunch of beers, but in the middle of it, we got to trapeze into a foam pit and play laser tag. That sounds like an awesome time for a bachelor party.
One of my buddies' bachelor party part, one, we did many things, but one of the things we did was paintball. So kind of we did the paintball and then we went to a brewery. So kind of what you're saying. But yeah.
Same vibe.
We're pumping out suggestions to Rob then as we speak. I'm sure he's already got something lined up.
I think he already has one planned. I think he already has his bachelor party figured out.
Like he already had it?
No.
Golf trip, I'm assuming? Something involved with that?
I think
that
he's
maybe?
Going to, he can, sure. I think he's going to Branson or something. He's talked about on there
oh,
before.
Nice.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I think he's, yeah, I, he was talking about on the drive like a week or so ago.
Keep an eye out for that invite. Yes.
I don't think that's coming our way.
What, to be one of his,
don't think so.
To be a
The question is,
just to go to the question party. Bachelor party doesn't have to be limited to just groomsmen. That could be a much more wide open invite.
You gotta ask Carrington if he got the invite. That's the real question. That's his direct coworker, like direct coworker.
They're like in a little weird mini cult together. They're always talking about how, like, I don't do anything unless it's with my guy. They're always talking like that.
My guess
like, they'll
is
come
he
in here for a half a sandwich, and it's like, well, I don't get a half a sandwich unless Rob gets a half a sandwich. And Rob will say the same thing with Carrington.
That's good,
They got a weird thing. Our vibe is not that.
That's
I'm looking out for Nero. That's it.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think he did invite Carrington to his bachelor party. All right, coming up next, though, let's check in on our Cody and Gold Bracket Challenge with some of our listeners. And now that we know Sneed is gone, will they free up $19.8 million? What are they doing with that money? We've got a plan next.
Cody and Gold, brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
There is a back-to-back Super Bowl champion, and it is the Kansas City Chiefs.
On your official broadcast partner of the Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
We're talking with Dr. David Bach, board-certified urologist at Kansas City Urology Care. Doctor, when it comes to prostate cancer, what makes KCUC the best?
KCUC treats more prostate cancer than anyone else in the metro, and for that matter, in this part of the country.
What does that mean for the patient?
As part of cancer care, a patient will need a urologist, a pathologist, a medical oncologist, and a radiation oncologist. We offer specialists, board certified specialists, in all those areas on site. It's important to a patient because they want the best possible care with the best possible outcomes with the fewest chances of side effects. Without a doubt, Kansas City Urology Care is the expert in prostate cancer therapy.
See the prostate cancer experts, Kansas City Urology Care. At KCUC, you see the best in KC. To make an appointment, visit appointments.kcurology.com.
Say goodbye to busted brackets because FanDuel lets you bet on every game of the tourney. Whether you're betting on a big upset or a one seed, it's time to go dancing on America's number one sportsbook. Right now, new customers get $200 in bonus bets if your first $5 bet wins. You gotta love the 12 seeds beating the 5 seeds. And let's check out Kansas. They could be primed for an upset. That's $200 to use on point spreads, money lines, and you can even pick who's going to win it all. Just visit FanDuel.com/610Bob and bet on college hoops until they cut down the nets. 21 and present in Kansas. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued as non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. FanDuel is offering online sports wagering in Kansas under an agreement with Kansas Star Casino, LLC. Gambling problem? Getting help is your best bet. Call 1-800-522-4700 or visit ksgamblinghelp.com.
If you're a pro and flooring is your game, we'll help you win it. Because at LL Flooring, all we do is floors. You want decor?
Strike.
You want plumbing?
You're out.
LL Flooring has been helping pros knock it out of the park for over 30 years. Visit one of our 400 nationwide warehouses for one-on-one service, extensive inventory, and exclusive pro pricing.
Oh!
Get the pro treatment you deserve. Enroll today, online or in-store. LL Flooring, every step covered.
This March, Wendy's has some amazing deals on their hamburgers made with fresh, never frozen beef.
Like a juicy Dave single for a buck and a fresh $2 Dave's double with an app offer.
It's such a good deal, we wrote a little ditty about it.
Get it for a buck. Dave single, order in the app. Dave single, get it for a buck. Choose wisely, choose Wendy's official hamburger or March Madness.
Limited time offer, participating U.S. Wendy's. See offer details and redeem at Wendy's app. Account registration required. Fresh beef available in the contiguous U.S. and Alaska.
This March, Wendy's is fueling the madness with amazing deals on their hamburgers made with fresh, never frozen beef.
Like a juicy Dave single for a buck and a fresh $2 Dave's double with an app offer.
It's such a good deal, we wrote a little ditty about it.
Get it for a buck. Dave single, order in the app. Get it for a buck. Choose wisely. Choose Wendy's official hamburger or March Madness.
Limited time offer. Participating U.S. Wendy's. See offer details and redeem at Wendy's app. Account registration required. Fresh beef available in the contiguous U.S. and Alaska.
eBay Motors is here for the ride. So minivans, sedans, JDMs, roll out. Go ahead. Feel your engine. At my admire that perfectly installed exhaust. Your vehicle's moving along this freeway like it was made from fresh installs and a whole lot of love. And with eBay Motors, you get over 122 million parts to keep it running. And with eBay Guaranteed Fit, they'll be the perfect fit every time. Plus, at these prices, well, we're burning rubber, not cash. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions apply.
Progressive presents advice on new teen drivers.
You know, the hardest part about teaching your teen to drive is the chafing from the seatbelt. But the best part is the grip strength you build in your knuckles. Okay, now let's pull out of the driveway.
Here's another tip. Offset a chunk of the cost of adding a teen to your insurance with Progressive's Teen Driver Discount and get a break from the break. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and affiliates, not available in all states or situations.
Find what you love, love what you find. A Total Wine and More, there's so much waiting for you. Spirits and beer, thousands of wines. Walk right through the door, it's all here to explore. With guides in the know and prices so low, it just might blow your mind. You're gonna find what you love and love what you find.
Responsibly, B21.
Getting your biggest tax refund from Jackson Hewitt can lead to some spirited reactions.
Jackson Hewitt, yeah!
Jackson Hewitt is so sure they'll get you your biggest refund that if they don't, you get your money back plus $100.
Jackson Hewitt, yeah!
Switch to Jackson Hewitt and we'll beat what you paid last year, even if you filed online.
Hewitt, yeah!
Ain't nothing to it. Switch to Jackson Hewitt and pay less for tax prep, guaranteed. Proof of prior year payment required when filing. New clients only at participating locations through April 7th. Terms at jacksonhewitt.com.
The 610 Sports Radio phone line is brought to you by Onder Law Injury Lawyers. Visit getjim.com.
Chiefs coverage brought to you by Max Motors. 9 major vehicle brands to choose from. MaxMotors.com.
Going on at all Max Ford locations.
Love it or trade it now.
0% for 72 months on new 2023 Ford F-150s in stock.
Pick your model, choose your color.
In Harrisonville, Manhattan, Richmond, Butler, and Nevada.
Hurry in while selection is best.
With approved credit expires March 31st, 24.
Can we just talk? Random question of the day coming up in 10 minutes or so. Cody and Gold, Alex Gold, Cody Tapp, Drew Nixon with you. Again, just saw some more tweets coming out around the stadium stuff. And a question that we even had with the CBA that came out last week, more of like a press release with highlights. Like, when does the actual detailed document become available? And it's still not, but the Royals and Chiefs announced today that it has now actually been sent to the Jackson County Legislature. And I just saw Manny Abarca put out a tweet, and I understand he's been very much pro vote yes, but I actually think his last tweet is relevant for those that are concerned that we haven't seen the actual CBA document. Hopefully that's coming soon, because he just sent out a photo from his desk of like what people were expecting last week, right? Which, sure, is a very detailed, looks like an actual legal document explaining in detail. Now,
more binding, presumably.
I would think. But that's the detail that a lot of people were hoping to get last week. So I'm glad to see that the documents are there. As people are like, where are the actual documents? I'm glad to see we're maybe getting closer. But again, the timeline is where a lot of people are frustrated, and understandably so, that a week from tomorrow is the election, and people should be able to see the full agreement before Election Day. And so that, I think that's always been fair. But for those saying it's like fake and it doesn't exist, that's also not true.
No.
There's a document.
I will say that it's getting increasingly weirder in their promotion. Like, I just sent you one that I had seen earlier for the vote no. And why do you have to get weird with it?
It's like a cartoon or a caricature of John Sherman.
You want to keep describing that?
Is that real?
That's, I don't know. No. Somebody made that. It's real in the sense that somebody.
It's not from a campaign, though.
No.
It's just some random
somebody who
person.
Somebody whose passion is graphic design.
Yeah, I'm going to stop describing it. I'll let people.
You should stop right there.
I'll let
it includes both owners of the teams. It says question one, swing and a miss.
Uh huh. I'm going to let other people do their own research on that one.
Other parts of it.
What a weird caricature.
Just like, what's, sir? Get some help. Get some therapeutic help.
Uh huh.
That's what you came up with. You could have made it anything. Why did it get so weird?
There's one part that makes it very weird.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, that's the weirdest part.
Yes.
Yeah. I think that was more they're
hit
just trying
the
to
DMs
have.
If that you would
one,
like to.
I think that one they're just trying to have fun. That's not like coming from an actual vote no campaign. That seems like somebody on Twitter just having a laugh.
It's like a cartoon that you'll see in like the funny section of a newspaper.
Oh yeah, it's a caricature.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Absolutely.
Uh-huh. But
one's trying to hit a home run.
But yes, one is definitely swinging.
The other one, not so much.
We'll get to the random question of the day coming up in just a few minutes.
It did just pass what's trending, but it's been announced. Shohei Ohtani is supposed to speak to the media today. We can talk about that in just a minute.
That. Now, who's interpreting during that press conference?
Not his old
Can't be the old best
friend.
Which we
can talk about in just a second, but Shohei Ohtani will not be taking questions from the media today.
Yeah, so he's giving out a statement.
According to Alden Gonzalez.
He's not really speaking.
He will read a statement at 2:45 Pacific time, according to this. So what is that?
Not till 4:45.
Here.
Yeah. So he's reading a prepared statement from his attorneys. Got it. Okay.
Yeah, be careful.
Okay. Well, I mean, he should be very careful with what he says.
Do you think Shohei was allowed to pick his interpreter, or do you think the Dodgers are like, look, we're going to find somebody?
My guess is they
picked this last guy. I don't know.
I'm guessing they have multiple interpreters on the team. But yeah, it can't be his other friend.
Yeah.
I don't think he can be that guy. Because again, that guy allegedly stole millions. I don't think I wouldn't want him around. If that's true, I wouldn't want my buddy around. If that's actually what happened, right?
I still think part of
it. We wouldn't be friends anymore if you stole $4.5 million from me. I can tell you that.
And the conspiracies around him have gotten wild.
Well, of course. This is what happens and why it's important for him to put out a statement today. I don't know if it's going to, you know, put everything to bed. Doubt it. MLB is doing their investigation. As you said, we'll talk more about this in the 1 o'clock hour, but
yeah, I told you, I still think they should put him on the exempt list until they know more.
Unless there's
enough leeway for them to legally do it, but typically they reserve it for domestic violence offenses. Yeah. But from like an integrity of the game perspective, they've always taken a hard stance on gambling. How many times have Pete Rose tried to get back?
Sure.
In the
I think the reason why they haven't put him on the list yet, until they get information that really starts to point, if it ever does, that he was betting on baseball or anything like that.
If they voted on baseball, is that enough?
What's that?
If his interpreter was betting on baseball, is that enough?
I think that's where
I
you
think
would
so
have
too.
To.
That's a massive problem.
At that point, you would have to look. But other than that, like as of right this second, this is why they're investigating, MLB is, as of right this second, all that has been alleged is that Shohei Ohtani had money stolen from him. I mean, I'm not saying that it's case closed. Like, we don't have to dig any deeper. I'm just saying, as of right this second, that's all that's at, you know what I mean? Baseball can't just assume the worst either. And you're right. Normally they take the cautious approach with violent crimes that are alleged. This is, of course, not that. And there's nothing. Shohei Ohtani can bet. That's not a problem. He can't bet through an illegal bookmaker. He cannot bet on baseball.
He can't gift friends millions of dollars if they're in trouble for betting.
You can gift a friend, just not for if you knew it was for bookmaking.
Yeah.
We'll see.
And for tax reasons, you have to.
Well, the federal government and MLB are two different things. Yeah, IRS might want to talk to him anyway.
I would think so. I think they're going to look through Shohei's old accounts.
I'll be curious to see, again, what he says or his interpreter says this afternoon.
We'll see soon enough. So 4:45 local time, if you're curious when you might hear what Shohei has to say about it. I'm curious how long of a statement it is. I'm sure we'll get into it tomorrow because it certainly won't clear anything up. But I'm curious to see how much he throws them under the bus and what that definition is.
He's going to phrase it as he was trying to help out his friend.
I'm going to guess he's just going to say, I knew nothing about any of this, and he just stole this money and had access to my accounts.
Oh, sorry, yeah. In the statement, he's not going to say, I think long-term, we're going to find out. I think long-term, we're going to find out he was helping his friend. But, yeah, so the statement, he's probably the best case for him right now. It's probably, no matter what happened, is going to be like, I had no idea. I just think there's a ton of questions within that. Like, how do you not notice he had access to your bank account?
Why? Why did you give your interpreter access to your banking information? That's a wild thing to do.
I don't care if he's your best friend.
Not like you're just standard checking account or a credit card. We're talking about $4.5 million and hundreds of thousands of dollars in wire transfers. Too much banking. You have to have your routing number for a wire transfer. This isn't like he snagged your Amex out of your wallet and logged into DraftKings and put a little $1,000 deposit.
That's
in.
Why I don't think he can say I didn't.
That's what his current claim is.
I mean,
he can say all. He can say whatever he wants. Yeah. But we can be skeptical of it, sure. Because I'm with you, but he probably can absolutely say that later on today.
How bad does it look if he does say it though? Like if he says it and we know
it wouldn't be the first time somebody quote unquote lied to try to cover something up, and then later on we find out they were lying. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I don't know if he's lying, by the way, but we're going through hypotheticals.
It has happened before, right?
Hypotheticals. There's definitely a lot of questions because going back to what you asked last week. Okay, so the alleged bookmaking operation that his interpreter maybe had an account with, if they didn't know he was associated with Ohtani, why would he get a $4.5 million credit? You know, there's a lot. That's why it's
fascinating. That would be abnormal. Like, Gold, even if you made $300,000 a year in your radio job, which you probably do.
Yeah, I'm just a few hundred thousand short. Yeah.
Even if you made that amount of money, no book on the planet, even an illegal book, would extend you $4.5 million in credit.
If you were just Joe Schmo. Now, again, if you know that your name is attached to Ohtani, maybe you do. Bruno Mars got, maybe, we don't know, allegedly $50 million. Yeah, he's Bruno Mars, but that's what I'm saying. Like,
you'd have to convince them that Shohei was backing you.
And
he could have been lying about that, but you would have had to convince that bookmaker Shohei was going to cover your losses.
Yeah.
But
someone says, can Shohei just use the offense? Like, oh, I didn't say that. My interpreter said that at this statement. I don't know what you guys are talking about. No, I'm pretty sure reading a statement on behalf of Shohei Ohtani. If you're just gonna have the interpreter read this statement, you might as well just say my attorneys are having a press conference today, and he's reading a statement, because that's all this is. It's a statement from his attorney.
My guess is he'll read it and someone will translate it, but I don't know that for sure.
That's what I was thinking.
Most crisis teams would tell you read it.
No, that's
even
fine.
If it's got to be translated.
That's fine. I mean, we're not going to understand it until his interpreter says it. So, I mean, that's sure. I guess that, I don't know if it really matters, but.
Do you see someone taking a photo of him standing next to Betts?
Yes, where it says Ohtani Betts, the back of the jersey.
That's just,
he's on the on deck circle on Ohtani, and then Mookie Betts is in the batter's box.
There's another one where he was at an NBA game, I think, or something like that, and he was given like a little side eye, and someone was like, yeah, I've seen that face before.
Yeah, the best was someone said, oh, yeah.
He's allowed to bet on NBA games.
Of course.
But he can log into DraftKings, FanDuel, ESPN, it doesn't matter.
At 4:45 today, Ohtani's going to announce his picks for the Sweet 16, actually. So can't wait for that. I did enjoy
that. Imagine, like, he gets to this whole thing, and he's like, I had nothing to do with this. But if you'd like $100 in free bets, use promo code Shohei.
That would be unreal.
My God, that moment would be all time. There's just no chance anybody would ever do that. I'm just imagining a world in which exists.
We might as well just keep talking about it for a second, and can flip what we were going to talk about, the Sneed stuff, back in the 1 o'clock hour. Because I'm thinking more, if you're the Dodgers, you just signed him to a 10-year deal, and I know there's a ton of deferred money. It's guaranteed, but also, like, if it
gets kicked out of baseball, it's not guaranteed.
Yeah, like, it's guaranteed, but if it's found out that he actually was really involved in this thing, there's no guarantee. The clause, you can't play because
no guarantee contract protects you from that.
Yeah.
If that actually happens, that might be the most interesting 30 for 30 that they will ever make.
It'd be the biggest scandal since Rose and the Black Sox. Because even if he didn't bet on baseball or throw a baseball game, none of which he did, it would be a $700 million player, one of the biggest stars in the entire sport, embroiled in a gambling controversy. Like, I still wonder if this goes south, if these sports betting leagues will evaluate how they partner and in which ways they partner.
You mean
with the gambling entities, how the leagues will. Yeah.
Gotcha.
How these partnerships work, what they want the associations to look like. I think it can have a damaging impact on that relationship.
So if you look at a part of the world, that has been ahead of us in terms of legalizing sports wagering. So the UK and
it's been legalized there forever.
Yeah. And how involved, like, the Premier League and these other soccer leagues, for example, they've backtracked over the last 15 years. Like, they're if you watch a game, you still see advertisements, but they have kind of eased back because of speculation, of concerns and all that. And I wonder if we'll get to a point where that happens, unless we find out that Ohtani was betting, you know, truly fixing games or something. I don't think this will be the story that does it, because one could argue, hey, if it's true and we find out that Ohtani was using an illegal bookmaking platform, that has nothing to do with a legalized sportsbook atmosphere that exists now in most states.
Yeah.
Versus, hey, he could have done 20 years ago. I mean, we all saw Pete Rose is that example. Now, depending on who you believe, he was fixing or not fixing games, but he was betting on baseball.
Yes. Which is an absolute no-no.
So if it's just that, hey, Ohtani We find out down the road that he was helping his buddy through illegal methods, you know, to gamble.
His buddy bet on baseball games.
You know, that I don't think will be like what brings it all down, because that'll be those, you know, people would argue, including myself, that that wasn't through DraftKings or FanDuel. Now, if it ever comes to be that we find out Ohtani had an account with FanDuel and was making bets on the Angels with FanDuel, that's a completely different story.
Uh-huh. Or the worst case scenario, which hasn't happened in sport, where they are shaving. They're actually betting against themselves.
And I still
And there'd
think
be no
that's...
player on the field who'd have more control over that than a pitcher.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's the easiest thing to throw of all time. Like, as a hitter, you can only impact the game 4 different times, and it still requires on your own personal ability to do so.
Mike, what's your... And again, and this is what we do, is speculation. But my guess still is that ultimately, not today, we're going to find, but down the road, we're going to find out that truly he was trying to help out his buddy that had severe gambling debt.
Yep.
And he realized that even doing that jeopardizes his career. And there's the federal, you know, wire transfer laws. And that is why the story changed. That to me is what I think actually is down the road we're going to find out. I still don't think we're going to find that Shohei Ohtani who had like $30 million in gambling debt.
No, and I don't think so.
I don't think that's going to happen.
And I'd be very careful about suggesting that if you're someone else.
Yeah, I know. Some other guy was on a radio station and claimed that he heard that that's what it was.
Yeah, know? Which I guess you could probably get careful there on the libel end. But I'd be, mm-hmm. Defamation. I'd be very careful.
Yeah. Oh, there's been a lot of that going on. Yeah.
I'd be very, very careful if I were to put those things out there. I think that they'll probably just try to get Epe to wear it. Like, my guess is that the story changed because they're like, hey, man, you screwed me. I was protecting you. I did all this stuff. You lied behind my back anyway. And now, in addition to this, I might be in all this trouble. You got to say that I didn't know anything about this. And they're hoping that that'll just pass the smell test. And because, like, I still don't think that that's what, like, it just seems impossible to me that
he didn't know he lost $4.5 million.
That he had access to, like, what? It makes no sense. Just the first hurdle. Why would your interpreter have access to $4.5 million of your money? Just for starters. Then, if he didn't have access to it and he got access to it later, they were paying him back in sections. So he's doing wire transfers to help start paying back this debt for like $100,000, like last fall. Like, it seems too organized for someone to just not know $100,000.
That's why I still think ultimately we're going to find he was truly just trying to help out his buddy pay off his buddy's gambling debt and didn't realize that, I can't even do that. And, you know, whether by the way, no matter what happens, even if all the facts come out, there's always going to be somebody now the rest of his life that are going to have some conspiracy around him now.
Sure.
That's just the sad reality of it.
And it might just be because of the bad decisions and you should have asked around more before you paid off someone's $4.5 million.
Yeah, I mean, like, if people don't, you know, if people don't like the end result of said story, there, you know, people will just be like, well, I don't believe it still. So they're just going to run. Like, that's the sad reality with this kind of stuff. Even if we get facts that say he didn't do blank, there will always be somebody that didn't like that outcome and will choose to go in a different direction. All right, let's get to the random question of the day.
Random question.
For you, Gold, for you, Drew, over in the text line, 913-586-7610. Of course, you can always follow us on Twitter, Twitch, YouTube, Facebook. We're at 610 Sports KC on all the streaming platforms. Question I had today, I very much sent to a friend of mine last night, and I don't know why it came up. I think it was because I was watching, like, you know, like somewhere over the weekend, I was watching one of those, House Hunters type shows. And, like, a couple, like, two women in their 60s were, like, moving to a house in Boca together. Doesn't matter. I thought to myself, what are the 3 most important things to you if you found yourself in a Golden Girl situation? So the question I have for you today is, if you, Gold, a widower, are moving down with your boy to Florida, or just anybody, which friend you're attracted to moving to, and you're just like, we're just going to be 2 single guys living in a house together in a retirement community. What are the personality things you think need to be similar for you to work well as roommates? That's what I had asked myself the other day.
Never in my life ever having a roommate again.
Even if you're, you know, 70, you just want like some company?
No.
That's it?
Not a like roommate. If you're not actually
in a nursing home or something.
Not a roommate.
But in this case, you have a roommate because that's how the random question works.
Yeah.
You've seen Golden Girls. It's a bunch of women who are widows living together in a circle.
Someone else like sports wants to thinking of betting. Someone else just wanted to bet on sports. That's it. You
so
know?
Similar hobbies. Good
that's
start.
It.
What
that's
about
it.
Cleanliness?
Yeah.
Cleanliness standards.
Oh. Yes.
Some people are messier by nature. I think you got to find someone with a comparable standard of what cleanliness means. It doesn't mean you both have to be like
you don't need
you have to understand what you both deem as being clean.
Yeah, just simply, yeah, that's very important as well.
I think, yeah, cleanliness is definitely a factor. I would say, along with the way that Gold would say, I want them to, you know, to gamble. I would like somebody to go play golf with. That'd be great.
Shared hobby. Okay, so this seems to be at the top of the list.
Shared hobby, I think, has to be up there.
That makes sense.
You got a friend in mind? You got a friend that you would, like, if you had to live in a situation like this?
Fast forward 50 years.
I can think of a couple of friends where it'd be fine. Like, we've never gotten in a real argument. They've never done wrong by me in any way. We both like to drink or gamble. It's like, yeah, this seems like it'd be fine to live. Like,
if we were, like, friends in mind, yes.
80, and we were just like, be fine. I'd have no problems at all. What about a sibling? Could you live with your brother? Wow, that was a no. That's an immediate no. Your sister? Could you live with your sister in this situation?
Hell no.
I think I would be
so
better.
So fast. Hell no. You guys lived together for 18 years.
Hell no.
I would be better. It'd be easier for me to live with my brother, I think, than my sister. My sister and I got into a lot more arguments and stuff like that. Where my brother and I did as well, but I don't think either of them would work. I recently, last year, spent a week with them at their place because they both split an apartment. And by the end of the week, I was like, yep. We're good.
There's plenty of people you could be great friends with, and it's one thing to live with somebody else that's way different. Just so different. So different.
But you know the friend that you're like, we don't see the same on life. Like, for the reason why you and I wouldn't work is I would want somebody.
Could you freaking imagine? Oh my gosh.
I would want someone who likes to cook.
Yeah.
Like, I would like someone to share in the responsibility. I like to cook.
Yeah.
But I don't want to make. I'm not turning, like, this is a widower situation. I'm not turning into your personal chef.
Yeah.
We need both people interested in being in the kitchen. That's not currently an interest of yours.
Right.
So, I'd want the other person to like cooking so that there could be a shared meal situation. Someone said simply toilet paper over, not under.
Yeah, yeah.
Are there under people? I feel like the only people who talk about toilet paper over, I've never heard anyone who's actually an under person.
No, that one wouldn't drive me as crazy. That's just a funny one because, like, that one wouldn't drive me crazy. But definitely the cleanliness thing. I mean, if there's going to be just, you mentioned cooking, but that's fine. But if you're going to have, like, pots and pans all over the sink and sitting for hours and hours, that would drive me crazy.
Are you a do the dishes the night of cleaning them? Or do you, like,
oh, it needs to be,
let a pot soak?
See, that would be driving me crazy. If you cooked at 7, at 7 a.m., that needs to be gone.
Oh, wow. So you're that guy, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
I usually clean up after dinner, but sometimes it's a next day problem.
Really?
Dude, it's just a timing. Sometimes it's a timing thing.
Yeah.
I don't leave it a disaster. I don't just leave that. I stack things together or rinse the appropriate. But sometimes I ran the dishwasher at 4.
Sure.
I'm not going to unload it just to reload it. This is tomorrow's problem. But I think a similar standard of cleanliness. Again, you could both be messy, but I think you got to be at least within a notch or two of what you deem. We might be able to get past the pots and pans thing if all the other cleanliness we agree on.
Someone says 913-586-7610. If shoes are out, they must be in the right spot, meaning left shoe can't be in the right and vice versa.
So you're saying when you're setting your shoes down, you can't have them.
You can't
reverse.
Switch them?
Interesting.
It's a very particular thing to.
You definitely, if you're gonna have multiple people live like that, and you gotta just go with the shoe, one of those little shoe rack things or something.
Well,
like that.
Along these lines,
my kids don't use them though. I mean,
wow,
that drives me nuts.
That's probably a different thing. Yeah.
Along these lines, are you a sock person or are you a shoe? Like, are you?
Oh,
are
see, that's
we've talked. We've talked about this.
I wear my shoes inside all the time.
Yeah,
so do I.
All the time.
When I walk inside, once I have already let my dog outside, and I know I'm gonna be inside for a while. The shoes go off, but I leave the socks. The only time I take my socks off are when I'm going to bed. But I
take my socks off.
You don't wear your shoes around.
No,
I'm either in my shoes or barefoot.
Interesting.
Socks are the worst.
So you just walk. Aren't you uncomfortable? Like, you get home and you're just wearing shoes still. I don't know.
Sometimes for hours.
Because if I'm laying on the couch, if I'm laying on the couch, I don't want my shoes on while I'm laying on the couch.
Having been in your house, Cody, it's more hardwood.
Yeah.
It seems like than anything else. That makes sense.
Main floor flooring. It's carpet upstairs.
Where if it's carpet,
it's old carpet, so
if it's carpet, I feel like, you know, my wife, like I would just be hanging out in shoes, like on the couch.
As the
detective
points out, I also own for the wintertime a pair of house shoes,
slippers.
Yeah, I mean that's essentially what they are. Yeah. They call them house shoes for that purpose. Mm-hmm. But yes,
that makes some sense. Yeah, no, definitely can't just wear the shoes the whole time. I just one, it's not comfortable, and then I feel if I'm on the couch and I'm laying down. It's definitely just not as comfortable.
I don't lay down on the couch.
Like, you know, you've seen my couch.
I might extend my legs, but my back is still upright.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying.
Okay, when you say lay down, I'm like, what is it, like laying on your side?
No, you've seen my apartment. You know, the couch hat, what do they call that? It's got, not a recliner, but it's got
chaise. Chaise lounge.
Thank you.
I got you.
It's got that.
Sure.
So that's what I mean by lay down.
But backs up.
Yeah.
And then your legs are out.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
I think some of that stuff matters. I think a similar taste in music might also be important.
If you're playing it out loud, yes.
So I think that, though, just changes. Once you have a roommate, the just we're at all the time just having.
In this situation, I want to still be able to live. I'm 80. I want to live my damn life. I don't have to listen to headphones for the rest of my life. We got to get along on
something.
Yeah,
I think if you've got a roommate, though, you can't just be blasting music 24/7.
Just cranking Frank Sinatra on the...
Frank Sinatra. Like, when I'm 80, I'm still just going to be cranking Dr. Dre. I'm not going to change my musical
taste. It's going to be Taylor Swift, you know? When he's 80 years old, he's going to have Taylor Swift going.
Okay, that's my random question.
You're a roommate in the shower, come fly. Yeah. That's what it's going
to
be.
I know when I asked this question, everybody would go through their brain and be like, who's the person if I had to live with like that? Like, if we're just like full-blown roommates and we're like 75 years old, and we're just living in a place together in retirement. Neither of us are, you know, like, we're both widowers. We're not, like, married anymore. Our kids are all grown up. I'd be like, who can I live with? And there's, like, I think there's only two or three.
Let me ask you this.
Are a good compatibility fit?
Who at the station, then? We joked about our show. Who at the station do you think you actually, let's just say for a year, live with for a year?
Cling.
Just because you just don't think it would be any, just mind
Cling.
Your own business kind of thing?
Okay, so, yes. I think Cling was very much like a be in his own world thing.
I think that's fair.
Like, I think he would just like be out of your way. Carrington's a hard no. I mean, just start there. You and I have personality differences. We probably, because we had to host in my basement for 4 straight months. By the way, we would get through the year. But if it was a year and a day, we might kill each other.
That's right. That's
so
accurate.
Like,
that's
a year
accurate.
Is probably like the maximum allotted time.
As soon as you get to 9 months, you're just counting down the days.
Yeah, I'd just be thinking about murder for like the last 2 months of that arrangement.
Yes.
And we would be like seething at each other the rest of the time.
I think that's fair. Drew, I'm trying
he's
to think
so,
what it would be.
He's so agreeable. It'd be hard to imagine to be.
Yeah, I was trying to think. I was like, I mean.
It'd probably be fine. You'd probably be high on my list.
Promise we'd start talking about Gonzaga being a blue blood or not, and Drew would drive me crazy trying to convince me about Gonzaga being a blue blood. That's what would happen.
I would drive you crazy probably along with the Bengals fandom as well. Like, if the Chiefs and the Bengals game is on, like, hey, can you turn it down? I'm trying to watch the Bengals game here.
Like, there's probably a difference between, like, why you would probably get along with Drew better than me is I watch plenty of sports. I host sports talk radio. I watch less sports than you or Drew. I don't just tune in to, like, Wednesday night college hoops in November. That's never on the TV for me. So, like, I'm just going a different direction with it. Feels like it'd be easier if, like, you know.
The good news is that's where you still have a bedroom. You can go watch something else.
Yeah.
Go do something like that. All right.
We don't do that all the time, you know?
That's the random question of the day. Up next, though, we were going to talk before we got into the Ohtani stuff a little bit about the cap space that now exists that Sneed has traded. So we've got a plan on what the Chiefs should do with it next.
Cody and Gold, brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
There is a back-to-back Super Bowl champion, and it is the Kansas City Chiefs.
On your official broadcast partner of the Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
Hey, it's Kling. If you're like me, sometimes a holiday just creeps up upon you, like Easter. It's just around the corner. So make Hy-Vee your one-stop shop for that perfect Easter meal. Hy-Vee has a wide variety of heat and eat meal options featuring spiral ham, turkey, or prime rib with your choice of sides. Maybe it's the mac and cheese or the mashed potatoes or stuffing. I'm hungry just thinking about it. Treat the whole family to a traditional brunch buffet at the Market Grill with all the fan favorites like eggs, bacon, sausage, pancakes, biscuits, and gravy. You hungry yet? Make this Easter the best ever, only at Hy-Vee.
Hop into Hy-Vee today for all your Easter needs. Floral arrangements, Easter baskets, candy, chocolate bunnies, gifts, and more. Spend less time in the kitchen when you choose from a wide variety of heat and eat meal options, serving as few as two or the entire crew. Treat the family to a traditional Easter brunch at the Hy-Vee Market Grill, just $24.99 for adults, $7.99 for children, and kids 5 and under eat free. Make this your most excellent Easter ever with a little help from Hy-Vee.
Well, it's one of my favorite times of the year. We got basketball games on television all day long. That means some late nights. Some of these games not getting over till 11:30 or so. And imagine if you're a contact lens wearer and you were having those contacts in from 6 a.m. all the way till 11:30. You know that feeling. Your eyes are going to get dry. It's not healthy for you. All that is how I used to operate until I called up DuraVision and found out that I was a candidate for SBK Advanced LASIK. And after going in for that consultation where they laid out a plan that was just designed for me, not a one-size-fits-all approach, I found out that, you know what, I don't have to wear contacts or glasses, and I don't anymore after undergoing my LASIK procedure. It truly has been the best decision ever, and you can make that same decision as well by calling them up at 913-491-3330. That's 913-491-3330 for that free consultation. Or just go online to DuryVision.com and tell them Gold from 610 sent you.
This is the time of year to enjoy life. Stop letting that pain in your joints keep you from doing what you want to do this spring. Call QC Kinetics now. QC Kinetics is the nation's leader in regenerative medicine. I'm talking long-lasting joint pain relief with no surgery, no drugs, and no downtime. Pro athletes have been doing this for decades, but now this life-changing treatment is available for you so you can walk and run and climb stairs and play golf and move again pain-free. No pain pills, no risky surgery. This is an all-natural solution. QC Kinetics has tens of thousands of satisfied patients who have reclaimed their mobility. Take action now and live your best life this spring and summer, and it's a great use of your tax refund check. Call QC Kinetics for a free consultation. 816-412-6299. That's 816-412-6299. QC Kinetics off 435 in State Line and in Gladstone. 816-412-6299.
Enjoy all your favorite sports like never before at BetMGM. Sign up using code BETKC. That's code BETKC. And receive up to $1,500 back in bonus bets if you don't win your first bet. When you register with BetMGM, you'll get instant access to a variety of parlay selection features, live betting options, and the best daily promotions in the business. And with BetMGM at your fingertips, every play and every game matter more than ever. Remember to use code BETKC. That's BETKC. And receive up to $1,500 back in bonus bets if you don't win your first bet. Place your money line, prop, and parlay bets with the king of sportsbooks today. BetMGM and GameSense remind you to play responsibly. See BetMGM.com for terms. 21 plus only. Kansas only. New customer offer. Subject to eligibility requirements. Rewards are non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire in 7 days. Please gamble responsibly. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. In partnership with Kansas Crossing Casino and Hotel.
Save big during MVP's bonus days at Lowe's with limited time deals on everything you need. Right now, buy one select DeWalt 20-volt max tool, get one DeWalt 20-volt max power stack battery 2-pack free, a $179 value. Plus, save $20 on a select bucket of Deck Plus wood screws. Find these deals and more in-store and online today. Because Lowe's knows savings. Lowe's knows pros. Valid 318 through 329 while supplies last. Selection varies by location.
I lock up my Old Spice Fiji aluminum-free dry spray to keep that 24/7 lasting freshness safe for myself. Fresh coconuts, palm trees in the wind. It's like catching waves in Fiji. Actually, I just talked myself into a refreshing spritz of Fiji. My Old Spice is missing! No!
Tax Talk with Straight Talk.
You give and you give. This tax season you get with Straight Talk Wireless. You get a reliable 5G network and unlimited data and a Samsung Galaxy A14 included when you buy an extended Silver Unlimited plan. Yeah. So you can give your janky phone to your kid. Yeah!
Switch to Straight Talk. Find us at Walmart and StraightTalk.com. For network management practices, visit StraightTalk.com. Device offer ends 4/14/24. Taxes and fees apply.
Getting quality employees to fill positions in your company is essential, but finding those people can be a major hassle, unless you use ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter makes finding quality people a breeze, and right now you can try it for free at ziprecruiter.com/free. With ZipRecruiter, one click sends your job to hundreds of top job sites. But more than that, ZipRecruiter's advanced technology identifies the candidates with the skills you need, sends you a list of great matches to review, then actively invites them to apply for your job. And the results speak for themselves. 4 out of 5 employers who post on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. That's right, the first day. Now you can focus on your business and let ZipRecruiter do the work finding the best people for you. See for yourself. Experience the ease, efficiency, and power of ZipRecruiter for free. Just go to ZipRecruiter.com/free. That's ZipRecruiter.com/free. ZipRecruiter.com/free.
You're listening to 610 Sports Radio from the Mission Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling Studios.
Hey, it's Travis Kelce.
This is Taylor Swift.
You're listening to the official broadcast partner of the Kansas City Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
KCSB Kansas City, WDAF HD2 Liberty, always live on the free Odyssey app.
Unless I stuck by you. 1 o'clock hour, Cody and Gold, Alex Gold, Cody Tapp, Drew Nixon with you. So L'Jarius Sneed, we all know, got traded on Friday, and we gave our thoughts a little bit earlier in the show, if you missed it on the podcast, on the actual compensation involved. But now that you know the Chiefs have an extra $19.8 million off the books, what's the plan? What's your plan, and what do you think they're going to do?
Well, they're going to spend it. Because I'll just tell you that right now.
Typically, they go right up against the cap. You know, yes, could they carry some over? They just really haven't done that. I mean, unless they want to pivot and change their path. I think two things came to mind immediately for what they could do. We have talked a lot about left tackle, and I still think maybe the draft is the best long-term option. But I wonder, with some of this $19.8 million, it's a one-year deal for a Donovan Smith type, you know, that's going to make, with incentives, $7 to $8 million or more.
Sure.
Is it another wide receiver? We were looking earlier today. Like, there's still some names that on a 1 year deal for your fourth receiver that maybe you feel better about than Sky Moore. You bring in a Josh Reynolds or a Michael Gallup, somebody like that on a 1 year deal with incentives. Maybe that's where some of the money goes. And then yes, if they are going to extend guys like Creed Humphrey or Nick Bolton, where normally those extensions year one doesn't have a big dollar amount attached, but they still might have needed to free up some space if they're going to suddenly have a bigger dollar amount than what they already have attached to Nick Bolton, because there's speculation that it could average out on a Bolton extension to be $14.5 to $15.5 million a year.
What's weird, though, is because of the raises they got based on performance, Nick Bolton, Creed Humphrey, Trey Smith, and others, they would likely cost less on this year's cap. So I'm not saying it's not nothing, right? Because signing bonuses and all this stuff, whether they extend one or two of these guys, because I don't think they're extending all three. Maybe we can get into that tomorrow. Like, you know, which of these guys would you extend? Which would you play out on a deal? But I don't think they're extending all three. So maybe that's a little bit of the money. Maybe a little bit of the money goes to a third running back. But I mean, this amount of money would suggest, Gold, a good size deal is coming somewhere. So what are the biggest positions of need? Left tackle, defensive line, and I would still argue wide receiver. Maybe make an argument for corner, because they just traded away an all-pro caliber one this season. So maybe corner. My guess is that there's still one decent-sized spin on the defensive line, and I think it's fairly obvious that that would be a Dana or so level. So $8, $9 million a year, there's half your money. And then a few million dollars on a running back. And then I think that they're going to make another play for a wide receiver. If it's my guess and what I would do, I'd get one more veteran wide receiver in here and leave no doubt, zero doubt, about how good your wide receiver in it unit is this year. And then at 32 this year, you can do whatever the hell you want. You want to trade up five spots because the left tackle you love is there? Cool. You want to sit at 32 and take a wide receiver? Fine. You want to trade down because your wide receiver room is set for the year if it needs to be, and you've signed a cheap veteran left tackle, and you've got Wanye Morse? Okay. Like, I think by doing those moves, you've essentially protected yourself against having to do anything at 32.
Yeah, they actually, you know, right now I even argue they kind of have some, because Chris Jones is back, and because they did sign Hollywood Brown on a one-year deal, I do think they have flexibility at pick 32 already. And when we know Brett Veach, when he's had more bullets in the chamber in terms of draft picks, that's when he's had his best work. It makes sense, right? You get more opportunities to
volume. He was a better volume shooter, apparently.
And then he had 1 year where literally
he just hit on
it was 90%. It's just insane, and that's not
realistic.
That's
why he's paying everybody more money right now,
And ultimately, that's why, like, what just played out with L'Jarius Sneed
is because they drafted too well.
In a weird way, yes. Yeah. I mean, that's the reality of it, and it's a good thing, but 2 years from now, there's going to be maybe another player that we all like, that we all think is a really good player, that probably does deserve a new contract, but they're going to have to make the tough decision and say, no, he's not the one of the four that we're considering having to pay soon. We're not going to pay him depending on the position that we're discussing. And this won't be the last time, and that's how you extend the window out. I mean, ultimately, we can have this plan of how do you spend the $19.8 million. It's because, in their mind, there's some better ways to spend it, duh, but also guys that they already know they have solidified that they want to give extensions to, and they need to have some more cap flexibility beyond just this year. Yeah, it's 19.8 this year, but it's also freeing up 20, you know, whatever the, you know, it's freeing up 20 yeah. million the next 3 years on a Sneed deal. That's money that you would have had to tie up. That's what it does, and that's why the extension for, you know, maybe a Creed Humphrey, Trey
Smith, extension money from Sneed is going directly to one of those guys, mm-hmm. right? Okay, so cool. But that still means 19 mil. Like, the Chiefs have too much money this year. They're never going to sit on it. They are back-to-back Super Bowl champions. This would be the dumbest year of all time, honestly, to sit on the cash.
Yeah.
To
what they've never done that.
No, yeah, they haven't. Yeah. They've spent every damn cent. I'm just like, that's another reason why it doesn't make sense. So that $19 million this year has to go somewhere. Someone says, hey, if they don't sign Renfro, they're sleeping. I like the idea.
He's one of many names of sure. guys that are probably on 1 year pretty reasonable Chark, Renfro, type of contracts.
Boyd, maybe even. It's not like his market's been bustling.
Yeah, I'm surprised he hasn't signed. But the longer it takes, the better for the Chiefs' perspective in terms of a finding, you know, what
hey,
the
deal. If you
get
Boyd for one for $10 million, isn't that like the wide receiver
that's
unit
of Hollywood Brown?
Rasheed Rice. Well, yeah, that's true. One for $7 million.
That's what's crazy. It's weird because the Hollywood Brown deal is so good.
It's so good. What
I'm willing to give to like a Renfro or Boyd type is way skewed now.
I think if it's on aggregate, I live my life. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
If on aggregate, I got a good deal, I'll live. But let's just say it's 1 for $8 for Boyd. And all of a sudden, your wide receiver unit is Rasheed Rice, Tyler Boyd, Hollywood Brown, Travis Kelce. Your fifth guy is Justin Watson. And you can take a receiver in the third mm-hmm. and hope he blows three guys out of the water and finds himself higher in the roster. And if he doesn't, well, then we'll just chalk it up to a Felix Anudike Uzama situation. And it's just a redshirt year till you get ready, till Hollywood and Tyler Boyd are no longer on this team because they're one-year deals.
Yeah, I think where I'm at now, the actual names, like wish list free, we did this with running back position just by its own right. I think for me, yeah, I'll probably roll with, at this point, like, okay, J.K. Dobbins plus basically Donovan Smith and pick whatever wide receiver of the group we just kind of mentioned.
And I want a defensive lineman.
And then draft.
Probably more than wide receiver.
Then draft a left tackle, a wide receiver, and a defensive lineman. Those are my three priorities heading into the draft now.
If I could spend my money anywhere in the free agency, it would probably be defensive line. But I've told you I would entertain first-round pick for that just because I think that is too valuable of a position to just completely ignore. And I'm looking at the free agent left tackles, dude. Donovan Smith the level.
Yeah,
Bakhtiari, Donovan Smith, Charles Leno, which got mentioned to the Chiefs at the time they were trying to go after Orlando Brown. He's 32 years old.
Yeah, health is the question with him, too, much like Bakhtiari. That's why these guys, that's why they're available.
Yeah, and I mean, these guys are going to cost $5, $6 million. And that's it. Well, maybe they're going to get a left tackle now. Mock draft center, baby.
Yeah, so we are going to go to one of our listeners, actually, does mock draft. Shout out to Lance. Put one together today.
This is from Lance. Yes. Listener Lance.
Shout out to Lance. I'm going to give you three rounds addressing all positions that we've talked about today. 32, Keon Coleman, wide receiver out of Florida State.
Okay.
64, Patrick Paul, tackle out of Houston. He's a guy that has been anywhere from late first round to more middle, late second round. That's where he's tended to fall to. And then Chris Abrams, Drain, Missouri corner. So
Patrick Paul, 6'7", 315.
He's a big dude.
Woo.
There's a lot of tackles actually in this draft.
Yeah. Is all like that six, size? Six, Jesus.
6'7". Okay.
But yeah, so a wide receiver, tackle, corner addressed in the first three rounds of that mock.
Positionally, I love it. You know, Keon Coleman's name was hot for a while and then kind of hasn't been discussed
his
as much
40
here.
Wasn't
really
great, but the consensus from Bink as well as other people who watched him play a lot in college is he's got game speed. Like he was, I think he tracked as one of the three fastest players in pads last year. So his 40 doesn't necessarily pertain to what he does on the football
field. Honest to God, that matters way more to me sometimes. Like the speed in which guys play when they're playing.
Yeah, it's fun. You know, we joked about the arm length thing. I was looking it up for Patrick Paul. 36 and a quarter. So they got
oh, my God.
Whoa, good God.
Yeah, so that's not a problem. That's not a problem with
him. That's 3 inches longer than Orlando Brown Jr. Is that guy, you know what? Bonafide stud.
Patrick,
no doubt about
Patrick,
it.
Patrick
it's right
Paul.
In the Chiefs needs.
Yeah, it says, here's the description from NFL Network. long athletic left tackle who's pass protection further ahead of his run blocking. Extremely long arms with the ability to land the first strike when his hands are right.
I mean, that sounds like an ideal situation to be the guy blocking for Mahomes. Of course, if you take him in the second round, Cody, if you take him in the second round, is it a true battle or is Wanya the guy? Say they don't sign a tackle.
It's
in
a
free
battle.
Agency, and
it's
they,
a battle.
It's a battle.
If a second round tackle.
If it's
a
second round, yeah. They,
first round, they basically, he's starting. Second yeah, round, yeah. It's a battle.
Yeah, because it's a second versus a third round pick, and it's, you know, battle to the death. Whoever, you know, like, I'm 100% with you, Gold, is that if you get to that point, then it's just whoever did the best.
I don't think
it's outside of that.
The text line said that him and Rashid would be a good duo. I think Keon Coleman would compliment. I love Keon Coleman. He would compliment what Rashid does really well with his ability to, you throw the ball up to him and he's going to go get it. He's going to out jump everybody. He can track it. Like if you, I don't know prime Mike Williams, I guess, in terms of like his ability to just go get a ball. Keon Coleman has got that ability. Obviously a lot younger and,
sure.
No injury history with Keon.
Okay, Keon Coleman.
6'3", 213 is what he at the combine. He checked in at vertical, 38.
I think I showed you guys.
Comp is Drake London, according to NFL Network.
I think I showed you guys one of the catches he had against Syracuse. I think I might have
He's an
it.
Above the rim artist.
He's single. So
Who
he
writes these things.
he ran a route up the middle. I'll have to show you guys again. I showed it to you.
Want the full sentence? It's better.
Oh, yes. Sure.
Above the rim artist with circus catches resembling a scene from the tents of Cirque du Soleil.
He ran a route up the middle against Syracuse, and I kid you not, jumped up. His feet were at the guy's knees, snagged a ball with one hand as he's getting held, and pulled. It was a ridiculous catch.
You know what's funny is the more and more I watch the Chiefs, the more I realize that that type of catch doesn't matter because Andy Reid gets guys more open than anyone else in the entire league. No one ever makes a catch like that because they don't have to for the Chiefs. I'm like borderline serious. They haven't had to make catches like that because everyone is always more open than that. I know it's not always the case. Travis Kelce,
boy, would it not be nice
catch.
To have both in your back pocket where I can just scheme you open, but also, you know what? If there's a moment where I need to throw it up there a little bit, especially with Mahomes' improvisation, yeah, that would be nice.
God, if they draft Keon Coleman, I know that I was on the AD Mitchell train of being up there with maybe more touchdowns. I think Keon would get a lot of touchdowns. He'd be a good red zone guy.
Is that a realistic spot for him? I'm talking about the fit in Kansas City. I'm talking about every mock's different. Like, truly, is he
projected
to really be there?
He's ranged everywhere. He's ranged from like 18 all the way up. He's ranged at like 18 at the Bengals all the way up to early second round, like in the mid 30s. He's got a wide range.
I know at one point in time, Chris and Bank over on the Character Concerns podcast talked a lot about Keon Coleman. You can go back to one of the episodes and listen to that. Also on Saturday mornings, you can hear Character Concerns podcast. And we'll start to, once we get the calendar turning over to April next week, we'll start to have Bank in on a more regular basis to talk draft once we're actually, are we a month out right now?
Yeah.
A month out?
I think a month to the day.
25th.
Oh, really?
I think it's the 25th.
Should have done like 30 mock drafts today, you know? Really missed out.
Yeah, just keep hitting the sounder over and over.
Just for the remainder.
We need 25 each day. And then tomorrow we only need 24 of them. And we're actually doing the reverse of it, Drew. We need 25, 24,
30. Like the 12 days of Christmas?
Yeah.
The 30 days of draftmas?
Mm-hmm.
There were a lot that came out today, actually.
I bet.
On the 30 days of draftmas.
It's always a Monday thing.
Red Veach gave to me one left tackle who can play the... Damn it. Had it. Almost had it. Lost it.
He almost did. It was close.
It was almost a moment. Would have been funny. Almost. Good stuff.
Thank you for the mock draft. Someone says, how about Mekhi Becton? He's a free agent veteran tackle that's been discussed. Yeah,
all right, he's out there too. But they're all kind of in that range. Becton is big enough that I would assume he would get like a real... But I also think that maybe they don't want Wanya to be challenged in that same way, you know? Who knows?
When Mekhi, has he been left or has he been right? I know he probably can play both, but has he been more right since he's gotten into the... The league, I don't
know. Maybe Jawan Taylor can finally go to left, you know?
Because I know the Bengals were in on him, and I don't know if that's because they needed a right tackle and he fit the billing for that because he had played it, or because I'm sure a lot of these guys that make it to the league have played both, at least in some capacity, whether it be just in college or.
Yeah, people are asking you to take control of the YouTube chat. We've got spammers in the YouTube chat.
Oh, man.
Can I read you some? There's one individual.
Yes. Drew, get it on the YouTube. We got to delete these people.
Yeah, there's There's a couple people. There's also one person that says, "Hello, I am from India." Someone else says, "Yeah." So I'm guessing that's some
fine.
Yeah.
Get in there and start
from Vive Shorts. Yeah,
we've Vive got, Shorts?
Yeah.
Okay.
We're getting a bunch of spam. Okay. Where's our moderators? We need moderators for Cody and Gold.
I was moderating the other one. It's just hard to moderate all the time.
Let's hire a moderator.
Hire a moderator?
One of our Cody and Gold listeners.
Can we trust a Cody and Gold listener?
There is one person that has posted 40 messages.
Is going nuts.
Yes.
All right, put user in timeout. Don't want to do that. Add as a moderator? Absolutely.
Someone's offering how to get free TV. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right, we got to block this person. All right, Benjamin.
I only know this because the text line said, "Do you guys know this guy on your chat?" I'm like,
absolutely not.
They are going insane in the chat.
Oh my, what are you doing, Benjamin? Yes,
it's a lot.
You've ruined the whole chat.
There's a lot. While you're looking at that.
I just blocked him.
Okay, while you're looking at that, I did see on social media over the weekend, so Pete Schrager was putting out some older clips and reminding everybody as we get closer to the draft, you know, just basically what is what was said at one point in time about some players, and he gave a really cool story about Patrick Mahomes, and he played the audio. We'll play it here in a second. Talking about Patrick Mahomes and just how much Mahomes was already thinking, maybe, Cody, about something that was going to happen in his future in the NFL.
April 25th, 2017. Mahomes was 2 days from being drafted and decided to spend some time at our table. Here's some of his memorable responses from our questions, including one about a 78-yard throw at his Texas Tech Pro Day. Enjoy.
We've been talking about all the players in the draft for weeks. I don't think anybody gets as excited like you do, man. I mean, we've really been geeking on this. The 78-yard throw, you did it at your Pro Day. We came in that morning, you're like, did you see what Mahomes did? He chucked this thing out of the stadium. Tell us about this, because this is you showing off, and I love it.
Yeah, I mean, me and my agent, my quarterback coach, Mike Shepard, we talked about what can I do to kind of set myself apart. And we look at Aaron Rodgers, who I love watching. And you see the Hail Mary and how it changes the games. And I wanted to pretty much say that, I mean, they kick a field goal with 13 seconds left. We throw one pass for 5 yards, we got a chance at a Hail Mary in the end zone.
Weird.
That was in 2017.
Weird.
He said they kick a field goal and we get the ball back with 13 seconds. I know the Bills got a touchdown, right?
I mean,
that's crazy, right?
Yes, obviously.
I will say that I just gave you
why 13
I
seconds.
Just gave,
he's Nostradamus. All
I
of
gave
a
those of you that believe in the NFL script. I just gave you guys the best piece of evidence.
Yeah, you did.
The best piece of evidence in 2017, pre being drafted by the Chiefs, he already gave an example of being down and going and getting a score with 13 seconds.
Bills fans go nuts.
Crazy.
Over sure.
God, I mean, that's just
eerie. Pete Schrager tweeted that out this weekend. It's like, what?
What, he's like just digging through the archives?
I think he was putting out a bunch of old draft stuff. Because, again, we're inside of a month of the draft and, you know, NFL Network. And
like, I do remember all the air raid stuff. That's what's funny about the draft. It's like, if it's like no quarterback's ever been successful out of blank, you're just like, yeah, until they are. Like, you realize, I saw that stat over the weekend, that not a single skill position player from Michigan has been drafted in the first round in like 20 years.
Yes, I'm trying to think of one.
Like, I'm dead. It's been like 20 years since a Michigan skill position player has been drafted in the first round. And you're like, wait, that can't be true. There's just no way. Nope, just defensive linemen, offensive linemen.
Braylon Edwards was drafted. I
corners, but not first, but not in the first round. It is legitimately
so
been
McCarthy
forever.
Will be the first. Yeah.
Yeah. But just the idea of like, and then you're like, well, then how could a skill position player work for Michigan? You're like, no, it's not that. You got to think about how, and the league was changing.
You mean Junior Hemingway wasn't going to be a top pick?
Mario Manningham?
Yeah, Mario Manningham.
The
That's
Bengals
a name
did take Chris Perry in the second round, I believe.
Chris Perry.
In 2005, I think, is the year. Hmm. Maybe I'm wrong.
Yeah, that's just wild to think about, but it makes sense if we, now that we're going through and not being able to name any legit skill player.
That's so, right. That is the perfect, I guess, explanation for it. Doesn't matter where you go, partially.
Yeah. So last year they had one first round pick. It was Mozzie Smith. He's a defensive tackle. You guys remember because
the Chiefs were interested.
Yeah. They had two first round picks last year. Aiden Hutchinson, Daxton Hill, both not skill position players. They had three more, or they had one more in 2021, defensive end, Page. Then they didn't have a first. They had two in 2019, so it took a couple years. Devin Bush, Rashawn Gary, Jabril Peppers, Taco Charlton. These are the. Their first-round picks are just linemen and corners. They even had, like, They don't have skill position guys taken in the first round. That's all. I know that's a weird, like, qualifier to put on it, but you would just think that, like, one Michigan wide receiver or running back, or, you know, you would just quarterback. You would have thought somewhere along the way a program as big as Michigan would have put some put some juice in the league, but I guess not. Someone says, don't forget Chiefs legend Jehu Chesson. Oh, man, look at these names. Also, so, did you read this text?
I did.
816? The one below it.
Oh.
Hello.
Yeah.
I am. Yeah. That one? Okay. Oh, yeah. I was like, did you read that one? Oh, my God.
They were making fun of the spam text when I said that.
I know.
Yes.
I did have to block that person. And, seriously, does somebody...
And they...
Is there a regular watcher on YouTube?
They also spelled it wrong.
I said Bob's.
Yeah.
Is there somebody on the YouTube channel? I'll make someone the moderator. Sure.
I think there's people that offered up their services.
All right. Tell me your handle.
To be a Cody and Gold moderator on our YouTube channel.
But look, you got to be judicious. Just because someone says... If someone pops in the chat and says... you know, Gonzaga's a blue blood. You can't just block people just because you disagree with them.
It's the same thing with our text line. Like, it's got to be pretty bad, you know, to get blocked
on
a text
line. They can go away.
Yeah, bots automatically scrub them.
Or if they start saying racist or sexist
stuff,
that's
an automatic one.
Boot them for that.
The last time a Michigan player was selected in the first round was indeed Braylon Edwards in 2005, number 3 overall by the Cleveland Browns. And the Bengals actually took Chris Perry in the first round, too. So. That was not a second round. That was in 2004. But
just to tell you how things did not work out for Braylon, he's only 41 now, and it feels like he was drafted
10,000 years ago.
Yeah, and he just, of course, didn't have a long career.
19 years ago, or that's how long
he last
been
played
since
in 2012. He last played in 2012. He was out of the league by the time he was 29.
Yeah, his career did not go that well in the
NFL.
Ended
up, you know what's weird, though? That he ended up with 5,500 yards as a receiver, though. So it wasn't like just you
all
like
in
trash,
Cleveland, right?
Trash. Majority. No, he played for Cleveland, the Jets, the Niners, and Seattle. But yes, his best season in 07, he was actually AP second team. Is that right? And a Pro Bowler.
Wow.
1,300, almost 1,300 yards.
Who was the Browns quarterback
16
then?
Touchdowns. Yeah.
The hell happened?
In 07. And then he played in 16 games the next year, only had 873, 15, then 8,680, and then just fell off.
Who was the Browns quarterback then?
Bad in
2007.
They probably had multiple. 2007 Browns QB.
I'm thinking of somebody's name and I can't. It doesn't.
Derek Anderson.
That's not who I would have guessed. But
five touchdowns to three different receivers, including two to wide receiver Braylon Edwards in a game against in a shootout against the Bengals in September of 2007.
Oh, that game might have been the 55-45.
Yeah.
There were 2 years I think, or maybe in the same season where the Bengals and Browns were like 50 in the 50s and 40s.
Braylon Edwards got all his what do you call it? All his yardage in that one game.
The Bengals tend to struggle against the Browns for whatever reason.
That makes their starting quarterbacks better than Joe Burrow's. What
it
I'm
is the
told
Browns
by Bengals
Super
fans.
Bowl. It's the Browns Super Bowl.
Because regular season wins.
Yeah, that's true. All right, coming up next, we'll get to what's trending and the second most important piece for a special season with the Royals opening day on the horizon.
Cody and Gold, brought to you by Heartland Men's Health, the leader in men's sexual health. Thousands of men have been successfully treated for low T, ED, and more, all with discretion and compassion. Make your appointment at heartlandmenshealth.com.
There is a back-to-back Super Bowl champion, and it is the Kansas City Chiefs.
On your official broadcast partner of the Chiefs, 610 Sports Radio.
Hi, it's Trey Smith. And in order for our team to get a victory, we need honesty, teamwork, work ethic, humility, and the golden rule. That's why my truck is from the dealer that embodies all those values, Victory Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram. And Victory Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram also supports Giving Hope, whose sole purpose is to feed and clothe the needy in Wyandotte County and beyond. Giving back in the highest integrity, that's how Jeff and his team do business. For your next vehicle, visit or go to victorychryslerdodgejeepram.com.
It's time to play ball, KC. Join Cody and Gold at the Rally House on East 39th Street in Independence this Wednesday from 10 to 2 to gear up for Royals season with all the latest and most popular Royals gear. Plus, enter to win awesome Rally House prizes. See you there.
Low testosterone affects many men today, even men as young as 30. But finding someone you can trust for quality low T treatment isn't so easy. This is Jeff, the CEO of Promenic Restorative Men's Health, and that's why I'm pleased to announce the opening of our second location of Heartland Men's Health right here in Independence, Missouri. Because as a Promenic affiliate, Heartland Men's Health has the experience and expertise to get you the right treatment for your particular medical situation. Heartland Men's Health is a leader in treating low testosterone. In fact, we've successfully treated thousands of men for low T and seen the amazing impacts low T treatments have. If you're like most men, you'll sleep better, have more energy, and improve mental clarity, get better gains in the gym, and your sex drive will likely improve as well. So call us. Just $99 gets you a PSA and T-test and a medical consult. And if you start on testosterone the day of your appointment, your visit is free. Call 844-447-6600 or go to heartlandmenshealth.com. That's heartlandmenshealth.com. We have two offices, Overland Park, Kansas, and our new office in Independence, Missouri.
Say goodbye to busted brackets because FanDuel lets you bet on every single game of the tournament. So whether you're betting on the big upset or you're picking the one seed to advance, it's time to go dancing on America's number one sportsbook app. Right now, new customers get $200 in bonus bets if your first $5 bet wins. There's nothing more exciting than having some stakes and some wagers on the tournament. So again, whether you're picking that thrilling upset or you feel like you're going to have the perfect bracket, the best place to showcase that is with my friends at FanDuel. They're giving you $200 to use on point spreads, money lines, player props. You can even pick who you think's going to cut down the nets. So visit FanDuel.com, use my promo code CDOT, and you can bet college basketball for a fun and exciting March. 21 and present in Kansas. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued is non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. FanDuel is offering sports wagering in Kansas under agreement. Kansas Star Casino, LLC. Gambling problem? Getting help with your best bet? Call 1-800-522-4700. Visit KSGamblingHelp.com.
Let's Save Lives. An introduction to suicide prevention in the Black community is an education program designed by and for the Black community, fostering connection and communication around mental health. To learn how you can encourage help-seeking and play a role in saving lives in your community, reach out to your local chapter of the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention at afsp.org/chapters. AFSP is an I'm Listening partner. Learn more at imlistening.org and on the Odyssey app.
The choice of a lawyer is an important decision and should not be based solely on advertisements.
At Underlaw, we're looking for brave clients who have been injured and are ready to stand beside us in our fight to improve the safety of our community.
Call Underlaw Personal Injury Lawyers at 816 or 913-9000.
If you're a pro and flooring is your game, we'll help you win it. Because at LL Flooring, all we do is floors. You want decor?
Strike.
You want plumbing?
You're out.
LL Flooring has been helping pros knock it out of the park for over 30 years. Visit one of our 400 nationwide warehouses for one-on-one service, extensive inventory, and exclusive pro pricing.
Oh!
Get the pro treatment you deserve. Enroll today, online or in-store. LL Flooring, every step covered.
This March, Wendy's has some amazing deals on their hamburgers made with fresh, never frozen beef.
Like a juicy Dave's single for $1 and a fresh $2 Dave's double with in-app offer.
It's such a good deal, we wrote a little ditty about it.
Get it for $1. Dave's single, order in the app. Dave single, get it for $1. Choose wisely, choose Wendy's official hamburger March Madness.
Limited time offer, participating U.S. Wendy's. See offer details and redeem at Wendy's app. Account registration required. Fresh beef available in the contiguous U.S. and Alaska.
Hey, I got a question for you. You hate bending over to put on your shoes? Wish you should just put them on standing or sitting without ever having to touch them? If so, then I have the shoe for you. Introducing new hands-free Skechers Slip-ins. With new Skechers Slip-ins, you just step in and off you go. You don't even need to lace up. So how do Skechers Slip-ins work? Well, there's a special smooth comfort pillow in the heel that helps your foot slide right into place. So just step in them and go. Find new hands-free Skechers Slip-ins for the whole family at a Skechers store, Skechers.com, or wherever stylish footwear is sold.
I can't believe tax season is here already. But look at all this info I have to enter.
Phil's small accounting firm is growing in numbers.
Why didn't I take that typing class in high school?
A data entry specialist could really help him in a crunch.
I got blisters on my fingers.
Indeed can help him hire great people fast.
I need Indeed.
Indeed you do. You can schedule and conduct virtual interviews all from your employer dashboard. Visit Indeed.com/credit and get $75 towards your first sponsored job. Terms and conditions apply.
At Target, count on our great deals just in time for Easter. Save $5 when you spend $30 on toys with Target Circle so you can fill their baskets with fun, like cuddly stuffed animals or 50-piece sidewalk chalk, all from only $5. Add an Easter chocolate faves at BOGO 50% off, from Cadbury to Reese's Mini Eggs and more. And get great family pics with new Easter looks. It's easy with 20% off dresses, polos, and more. Hop in fast for our best Easter deals, only at Target. Restrictions apply.
The 610 Sports Radio phone line is brought to you by Underlaw Injury Lawyers. Visit GetJim.com.
BetterHelp. BetterHelp.com/stuck.
Are you speeding right now? Do you feel like you're speeding through life, avoiding things you need to face? BetterHelp online therapy can help you slow down and overcome challenges. Visit BetterHelp.com/stopspeeding to get 10% off your first month.
What's trending?
All right, let's check in on the hot topics. Trending.
Number one on What's Trending, the Sweet 16 field is set. No Kansas in the Sweet 16. We all saw that blowout loss to Gonzaga over the weekend. So we are left on Thursday with four games this coming week. Arizona, the 2 seed, the early game will take on 6 seed Clemson, one of the surprises of the tournament. Then number one, UConn, who's looked dominant so far, they'll take on the 5 seed San Diego State Aztecs. You got North Carolina, a 1-4 matchup against Bama. Iowa State, the 2 seed, will take on Illinois. And then on Friday, one of the biggest surprises, I would say, of the entire tournament, 11 seed NC State will take on 2 seed Marquette. Purdue will take on Gonzaga, Houston, Duke. And then the late game on Friday, 2 seed Tennessee will take on 3 seed Creighton. It's been a fun tournament, man. I've enjoyed it. I'm looking forward to some, like the two matchups that stand out in particular, Iowa State, Illinois, and then Tennessee, Creighton. They're both the 2-3 matchups, so it makes sense. But those two could be the best games remaining.
I'm interested in that North Carolina game as well. I still think Houston will get past one more, and I still think UConn will get past one more before we have to really think about a sweat for them, but we'll see. Tournament always comes with surprises. Next up on What's Trending, the Chiefs and Royals have announced over the weekend somebody pulled up the documents that you have to submit when you're filing for more ad time. Well, they're going to drop another $500,000 each into their Vote Yes ad campaign. That means it's up to $3 million in total spending on ads for that vote coming up just 8 days from now. They also reportedly gave a new community benefits agreement, the full version with all the little tiny details, over to the Jackson County Legislator's Office with the actual lease terms. So ideally, those things will be made public here shortly, so that all the voters can see it here with a vote a week away.
That's what a lot of people have been asking for, and understandably so. And it sounds like, you know, but the idea that it was some made-up agreement is being put to rest right away because there was some photos that already went out of the document on some legislators' desk. But they should make that in PDF form or whatever available for everybody, and I hope they'll do that with the election a week out. Next up on What's Trending, movement in college basketball today. A couple hirings. Utah State's Danny Sprinkle, after 1 year with Utah State and winning the regular season of Mountain West, he's now leaving for the University of Washington. So he'll be the Huskies' new head coach as they go to the Big Ten. Also, some other news, Washington State's head coach, Kyle Smith, after a great year there, he's leaving for Stanford. Remember, Washington State's not a Power 5 conference next year, so makes sense while he's jumping ship. That's where some coach movement is. And in the last couple of minutes, just saw this from Pete Thamel, that former Missouri Tigers men's basketball coach, Konzo Martin, and Missouri State are working towards a deal to make him the school's next head coach. He, of course, was the head coach at Mizzou, Tennessee, and Cal, and most recently has been an assistant coach on the Texas Longhorns coaching staff. So another head coaching gig for Konzo Martin in Missouri Valley. And now Missouri Valley, who knows what that's going to look like anyway. Drake just lost their head coach and best player as their coach is leaving for West Virginia. So
maybe a little
an
opening.
Opportunity maybe for Missouri State.
They've been in the tournament the last 5 years at some window, I think. I can't remember exactly when, but I can at least remember them on like a 12 or 13 line not that long ago. I mean, not recently, obviously, their head coach is getting fired, but you get the point. Next up on What's Trending, the NFL Rule Committee is working on several different rules as it sits right now. They banned hip drop tackles. Those are gone. They've allowed for a third challenge if you just get one of the two challenges correct. That was per the Detroit Lions. Those are the two biggest ones. They have also said that in the last 2 minutes, they'll be able to look at roughing calls and intentional grounding calls from a booth review, in which it would need to be objectively the case, not a subjective call to be the case. But in those two rules, they'll allow them to take a look at it. They have not yet voted on the kickoff rules, although that really sounds like it's heading in that direction too.
Yeah, just one point on your Missouri State. The last time they were in this tournament was when Konzo Martin was the head coach in 08 and
011,
I believe.
Oh, okay.
Or not 011. 11. Yeah. But yeah.
So 08 to 2011.
Yeah, so I think that's when they were last in the tournament, which is why, you know, they want to bring them back. Good old days. That is What's Trending. You're on Cody and Gold. I was looking up his, I didn't realize it was 08 was when he first started coaching at Missouri State. A lot of coach movement, man. Some of them make complete sense, though. Like, if you're the head coach at Washington State, it's great. You had a great year, but, like, your program, your school is not going to be in a Power 5 conference anymore. You can't turn down a Power 5 coaching gig. You know what I mean? Like, some of those are obvious. And then same with, DeVries or whatever. He's going to West Virginia. You were at Drake. You've had 2 good years. Like, you got to strike while the iron's hot. You got an opportunity to go make way more money, first of all. And your son's got a year left of eligibility. Some people thought maybe he would stay at Drake until his son graduated, but Now his son will go to West Virginia and help him start a program and build a, you know, build a foundation there.
Yeah, I think so.
The question for Washington State will be, they've got a player that's going to be a hot commodity in the transfer portal. And now that their head coach left, will he go with his coach over to Stanford? Or will he just now say, you know what, I'll just go ahead and start fresh because he was one of the best young players. I think Rice is his name. One of the best young players. Yeah, Miles Rice as a redshirt freshman this year.
Yeah. I mean, it's look, you've got choices, certainly, if you're there. But, like, this is just kind of the movement we kind of expect in college basketball. You know, it's like, I mean, just between the last 2 days, there's been, like, everybody left every little tiny school and went straight to. I think sometimes people used to stay a little bit longer in those schools looking for, like, the great, like you said, Power 5 job gold. But either you're in the Power 4 or you aren't. You or the haves and the have-nots have gotten worse in college basketball. So if someone's offering you a job in one of those places, you go.
Well, Dusty May, who's the head coach at Florida Atlantic, last year they go on the great run. This year had a nice season, but they were knocked out right away. He takes the Michigan job. Like, you can't stay at FAU. You just had two more years of success there, but you know how many more? Is your name going to be any hotter than it is now? And that's also why I think you leave for Michigan, Big Ten job.
Well, he also – so he graduated from Indiana, was a manager under Bob Knight.
That's
and
cool.
IU fans, I don't think, are very happy that they still have yet to get him because he was a hot name for them last year. They ended up sticking with Mike Woodson, and they still stick with him and miss out on Dusty May.
That's right. All right, so let's talk about Royals in opening day. Thursday, we're going to be out of Kauffman Stadium.
Yep.
Gate D, so stop by and say hello. We'll be right out there, again, set for opening day. The day before, so as in Wednesday, we're going to be out at Rally House in Independence. So get your gear, get stocked up for the baseball season. Maybe now that Bobby Wood Jr. is locked up to a long-term deal, you feel even better about buying a Bobby Wood Jr. jersey if you've been holding off.
I think so. Now, well, I don't know why you're holding off, but yeah, sure.
Maybe you're like, I don't know if he's going to be here long-term. Well, safer than ever to get the Bobby Wood Jr. jersey. And when we're thinking about what this team can do this year, if you look at this team and you think they could have a really special season, clearly they have to have multiple pieces take the next step. And other than Bobby Wood Jr. continuing to be on the superstar path, who's the next most important piece? I think I could just list off three pitchers if I really wanted to, but I'll give you a position player before we get to the pitching staff, because I actually think MJ Melendez is a player that if you told me they won 80-plus games, MJ Melendez likely has to have his best year in a Royals uniform for that to happen. And he has to be the type of player that when we've had Vernon, we've talked about that. Hey, he's got potential to be a 30-plus home run guy. Like that's what he would have to be. If you told me we're here in September and this team is venturing towards an 80-plus win season, my guess is he's one of the pieces that is having a career year.
Yeah, I think so. I think Vinny's right up at the top of the list if I were choosing position players. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I think MJ Melendez, Vinny Pasquantino would probably be at the very top. I just realize their offense was kind of run-of-the-mill last year. They weren't a bad offense, Gold, but they certainly weren't a good one, right? They're like an average Major League Baseball offense, especially once they got the young players in the lineup and got some of the dead weight out of the lineup from earlier in the year. They were about league average. Well, they got to be a lot better than that, and that's the unit that could still be better. It's why I think Vinny is such an important player to the roster this season. But I still think if it just had to, like, choose anybody on the team, it's pitching. It's Cole Reagans.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Bobby Wood Jr. is still more important than Cole Reagans because he's going to be asked to carry some freight. They do something and they go to a playoff run, Bobby Wood Jr. is going to be spectacular. He's going to have a 40-40 year, right? It's going to take that kind of effort for this team to go to the postseason. He's going to have to be in the conversation for MVP or at the very least, one of the best players in the American League. Like how Major League Baseball sent out their promo video and been like, this week, baseball starts, and they show like eight players in it. You know who one of them is?
Ohtani?
Bobby Witt Jr. Probably Ohtani. I didn't. Should have looked.
They didn't scrub him yet. They're not done with them. They didn't scrub him.
Actually, don't remember. He was.
His name also was mentioned in the commercial. He wasn't just in it.
Yeah. Well, you know, things happen. They'd already produced that bad boy, so things are a little bit different. But yeah. But when you look at where they are, Cole Reagans is so important. But what's funny is because I count on him more, in weird ways, it's almost like Waka might be more important or Singer. If they're actually going to do the special thing, you know, they're going to make a postseason run. If it's early September and we're talking about a team that has a chance, Gold. Okay, they're three back of the Guardians. They got them for a three-game set coming up this weekend. What can they do to close the gap? Can they get two out of three? Can they win all three? You know, whatever. Those players are going to become vital. Bobby's still the most important player, though. Not just because he's the highest paid. He's just He's the most talented. Your most talented player is your most important player.
No question. And you mentioned Reagans. Yeah, he's an obvious piece. I mean, honestly, I probably would just say Waka, Lugo, and Reagans, Lugo and Singer along with Reagans. I mean, I think it goes without saying, we know the biggest issue this team had last year on a terrible team was pitching. There's plenty of other problems, but pitching, and you never can have enough of it. We all know that. And so if you're asking how does this team in August and September in the mix, it probably means not just Cole Reagans and the pitching staff. It probably means they got two guys at least, if not three, really cooking in the rotation to go along with it. You need this perfect storm to go together and have a special season. So that's like best case scenario type of stuff. Truth be told, they'll probably have some injuries in the rotation like most teams. And then the question is, okay,
Can Daniel Lynch step up?
Can he step up? Yeah. Can you get Jordan a little Lyons. Bit more from Alec March all of a sudden as your fifth starter? Things like that. But I'm obviously excited for opening day. And the difference is when you're looking at their rotation in how it stacks up against the rest of the AL Central in particular, where, you know, the Twins are the favorite to win this division. And then you look at the Guardians and the Tigers all have better odds to win the division. I don't think their rotation is that crazy and that far off from the teams that are listed above them. And that's why they've got a chance maybe to have a special season to where the bar is so low and the divisional bar is not even that high in the AL Central that maybe we could actually have a fun summer. That's all I'm asking for. And I know it's all a lot of Royals fans have been asking for a while. And it starts truly in the month of April and avoiding the disastrous Aprils that they've had. And it's a brutal schedule. I mean, it's not an easy one either based off of previous years and what people expect some of these teams to be. And we know we get going on Thursday.
If you want a best guess of the Royals opening day lineup, look no further than tonight, by the way. They're in Northwest Arkansas, where they're taking on themselves, right? They're taking on people who have been optioned to the minor leagues. But it's an exhibition for Northwest Arkansas. They did this thing in Omaha.
You've been to that stadium?
Yeah, I have. Yeah,
we were there for Bobby Wood Jr.
when he was a minor league player. Boy, didn't that pay off. That bet paid off. It was the only Cody and Gold road trip we ever took. We went down to Northwest Arkansas because Bobby Wood Jr. was too damn good to ignore.
That was a fun trip.
It was a fun trip. A bunch of people came.
We had a lot of listeners. There's a ton of hype, and justifiably so, around Bobby Wood Jr. We had the Witt t-shirts. And we, what's the name of the street down there in Fayetteville that we went on downtown? I can't remember.
Oh, damn.
Because we asked Whit Merrifield for bar suggestions. Remember?
What's the name of that street?
Oh, that's going to drive me crazy.
I don't know. It's the main bar for the college, the main strip for the college town, so you can figure it out. The lineup today, Dixon Street. Garcia, Bobby Wood Jr., Vinny hitting 1-2-3. Salvi, MJ, Hunter, Renfro, 4-5-6. And then Frazier, Velasquez, and Isbell hitting 7-8-9. Brady Singer on the bump.
Okay.
Against a bunch of minor leaguers, you know. You want to see if John Rave can dice him up.
Do I?
I don't know. I mean, it's close enough to real baseball now. I don't need spring training baseball anymore. I want the real thing on Thursday, in which the current weather, oh God, please hold, says that it'll be 66 degrees and sunny for opening day. Oh, please. I'm begging for that kind of
weather.
Opening day, are you kidding?
Bobby Wood Jr. bobblehead as well. We're going to be all out there for Drew. It'll be your first. Oh, and not the first opening day, I should say. Obviously, you've been to K last year.
It will be the
year.
First opening day.
First
yes.
opening day for you at Kauffman.
Ever. I've never been to an opening day
period.
In my life.
Okay, cool.
What? So that'll be a lot of fun.
All right, there you go.
Are you looking forward to the bunting?
It's going to be everywhere, man.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to
it. That's not on every stadium. That's only for opening day.
It's going to be everywhere
Drew's
for opening day.
Drew's never experienced bunting before.
I'll have to talk to my
wife
about
bunting during the postseason sometimes. Sometimes
that's
true.
There is.
That's
bunting. Have you been to a postseason baseball game?
No, I've never been to a playoff baseball game.
Then Drew's never seen bunting.
And with my own two eyes, I've never seen
Wait till you see that bunting.
Oh, I'm going to be excited. I'm going to mention it, and my wife will not know anything what we're talking about.
It's a pretty good idea from the 816.
I see it.
610 should host a Witt t-shirt contest this summer at the tailgate at the K. And this, real quick.
Yes.
Is this suggestion that people are wearing white Bobby Witt Jr. t-shirts and that we honor what would normally be the other end of this, or is it just who comes in wearing the best Bobby Witt Jr. t-shirt?
My guess is that's what it would be with the play on the other. Yeah, but I think that's what it would be. It could just be any Witt t-shirt that you still can get wet, but not, you know?
But not the same way.
We do have, like I said, we have some stuff planned this week. We'll be outside Gate D on Thursday, and then
you
on
want
Wednesday,
to include a Witt t-shirt we can contest.
It's too cold for that. We need to wait till it gets in the 80s or 90s.
Oh, that's a good point.
We need to wait. I mean, that could be.
Is the bobblehead like a giveaway to the first
20,000?
Oh, 20,000. All right, well, I'm going to be here. I told my wife, I said, come here to the parking lot. We'll drive straight from here and go. I don't want to go home, but we're going to go straight there because I'd like to get a bobblehead. It'd be great. I don't know how quickly they're going to go.
Can I give the
sure
the news on that?
Yeah.
I think this one is not – this one is employees only. I'm not even kidding. That's what the email said.
This morning
you got special word from the boss. You're good.
No.
This morning we received an email from the boss.
It's from the person who sent the email. I saw the same thing. I saw the same thing, and they go, do you want a plus one? Do you want an extra ticket? And I said, yes.
See, good. You're on the special list then, because at one point there was no plus ones allowed.
I'm not on the special list because I originally thought that I was late. I didn't even email until this morning. I said, hey, totally forgot to email you.
Even better if they had extra tickets.
And they might have extra, yes. Because that was the same thing.
No, I was
they get it up for everyone in the building? And sometimes he was worried you were inviting Brady and didn't have a ticket.
Correct. Thank you. That's truly what I was thinking at the time.
Yeah, yeah. I was told that if I wanted an extra one. Because I told her yesterday, I said, I don't know if you'll be able to come because it says it might be employee only. And she's like, oh, that's fine. So I think we're good.
It's never too cold for a WIT t-shirt contest. Quit being silly, Gold.
It's a great point, you know?
66, you know?
That's warm enough.
You're making me doubt. I'm going to check my email now again.
No, you're good. You're good, man. I honestly thought you were like going to show up and not have a ticket. And by the way, tickets are still available for opening day. Anyway, you can buy tickets.
Yeah, but you know.
And we're going to cash in our crown seats at some point in the next couple months.
Fair win.
If we have room for a plus one.
Oh, well, look, still a chance for it.
Potentially. If not, it'll be just me. That's fine.
But either way, we'll try to get you there early enough to get a Bobby Wood Jr. bobblehead, you know?
Yeah, and I hope we see some people at a rally house on Wednesday.
To get their Bobby Wood Jr. jerseys.
Anyways. Jerseys, whatever you need, man. Windbreakers.
I need a new hat.
I need to get a Bobby Wood jersey.
I need a new, like, classic Royals blue hat. Mine are all beat up.
You guys will have to tell me if the Bobby Wood jerseys have the Quick Trip logo
we'll
on them.
Because
if they do, I'm not getting a jersey.
Really, dude? Yes. What do you have against Quick Trip?
No,
I don't know if the ones at Rally House have the QT. They probably still have stock of the ones without them, so my guess is you don't have the QT ones yet.
Cody, you know as well as Gold does, I come in here at least a couple times a week with a Quick Trip drink. I love Quick Trip, but on a jersey, I do not want to wear. If it was a blue.
People won't care after a while.
I know, but if it was blue, I know it's not their colors, but if they matched it with the Royals colors, I would absolutely not mind it.
I think after a while, people won't notice the Quick Trip thing as much. And you're like, well, then what's the point for Quick Trip? I'm talking about from the people that are, like, complaining about it. Like, I think there is – I'm laughing at the text, too. I'll read that in a second. I think the Quick Trip thing, if the team's winning, nobody's going to give a damn that it has a giant QT on the side. No. The text was reference to somebody that we kicked out of the YouTube chat that was spamming.
Claiming to be that person.
I don't think it is. They said, this is Benjamin Blank. You want to ban me in the chat? You better be ready to throw hands at Rally House.
Okay, so you think that I'll challenge Bill Romanowski to a fight, but I won't take your ass, Benjamin?
The difference is Benjamin.
Bring it!
Benjamin will show up. Romo ducked us.
Correct. Yeah, he
Romanowski, afraid. Didn't want the smoke.
It's not even that he didn't even want to come up to us. He wasn't even there. He wasn't in the city.
Mm-hmm.
That was the amazing thing. No, the reason why I saw the Vinny video where Bobby's throwing the seeds at him or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He turned and I saw the Quick Trip patch and I was like, yeah, I don't like it.
That's such a great video, though.
No, the video is great.
Focus on the wrong thing.
It stood out to me like a sore thumb because he turned a little bit and I saw it. I was like, oh, no, there's the patch. Nothing against Quick Trip. Just the patch is huge, too. It's not like they couldn't have made it a smaller square.
I think it's the same size as all the other patches.
You were talking earlier about how like the EU is ahead of the US as far as like sports wagering and how long they've had it and reworking kind of the configuration of how they take it. This sponsorship is exactly the same. Nobody says anything, and they are wallpapered.
Wait for the next
sponsorships in European soccer.
I bet you in 10 or 15 years, maybe less, the NFL is going to have a jersey sponsor. They already have a training camp one. The NFL one is going to happen.
Well, the soccer clubs, it's like the first word. It's not even like it says your team name on it.
If the patch, I kid you not, if the patch was smaller and it was in like the top right corner, I would not care. It's because the thing is
fair enough.
A block. It's like a slice of cheese that you get at the store and they popped it on a jersey. That's what they did.
All right, we're back at it tomorrow on the show. We're expected to have Jonathan Katz of Fox 4 join us. He's done a great job reporting.
Breaking news, though.
Okay,
breaking news.
Yep.
It's not important news, but I'm going to let you do it anyway.
Okay.
The Royals have announced a new partnership with Coke.
Oh.
Coca-Cola in the stadium now. No more Pepsi.
Second jersey sponsor.
Yes.
Here it comes.
No more Pepsi.
Yes.
Coke in the stadium now.
All right.
All these years of those dollar nights with those small Pepsi cups. They're not Coca-Cola. I'm Team Coca-Cola over Pepsi. Sorry.
As am I.
Yeah. All right. We'll talk to you guys tomorrow. Cody and